Well, it's February 28th, 2019, and coming to you from the Troy Lee Design Saloon in Corona, California, it's the Whiskey Throttle Show. Thanks for tuning in. I'm your host, David Pingree. Joining me here, GL, world champion, supercross champion, motocross champion, supermoto champion. Guy's done a lot. Donnie, he's done nothing. He's over here. DJ Donnie, our producer on the big screen over here. He's got as many titles as I do.
I continue to still do.
But you guys are the people's champions.
Yeah. That's right.
I continue to still do
that matters.
That's right. That's right. I want to give a quick shout-out to Volbeat, the band that bringing us in there with our intro and our songs in the middle of this show. Really like those guys, and check them out. Cool sponsors for this show. I don't know if you've heard or not, but PowerDot is bringing you our featured guests. We got Method Race Wheels, Decal Works, Four Wheel Parts, Troy Lee Designs, Dunlop Tires, Pro Circuit, Adidas. Some really cool companies coming on and supporting our show, and we really appreciate it. We've got some cool segments coming up. Want to give a quick shout-out to RacerX. Go to racerxonline.com/subscribe. Get yourself subscribed. Get a free Skosh battery charger for your phone. Very cool if you're out on the go and worried about running your battery out. And I would suggest also going over to mxsports.com and checking those guys out for the RC SX in Daytona. They've got a really cool vintage event coming up on Tuesday after the Supercross. If you're in that area at all and you've got an old two-stroke or a really old legit vintage bike, you are not going to want to miss that. It's going to be a super cool event. You'll be able to be on the actual track. Obviously, it's going to be knocked way down, more of a motocross style. They're not going to leave the triples for you on your 74 Hadaka, but it's just a cool experience being able to be inside the big oval.
Awesome.
Yeah, I think it's going to be amazing.
I like what they're doing. You know, there's been such a resurgence in that, you know, collector bike or the historical side of motocross, and I think it's really neat that they're bringing it to the forefront again, and I think they'll get a big turnout. It's going to be cool.
I think it's going to do great, and they're kind of trying to soft sell it this first year just to make sure everything goes all right, and then yeah. I think you'll see it really start to grow as the years goes on. But if you're down there, check it out. Today on the show, we've got Ryan Hughes, and Ryno had an amazing career that spanned a good length here in the U.S. Then he went over to Europe, did some GP racing, came back to the U.S., had more success, so what an amazing racing career. We're going to talk all about that. And he's an interesting cat. He's had an up and down go of it since retiring from racing. And he's not scared to really lay it all out and go through that. So it'll be fun talking to him today. And he's brought to you by PowerDot. Check out PowerDot.com. If you go to PowerDot.com/whiskey throttle, you can subscribe. You can get signed in to win one. We're going to give them away on a regular basis. Every live show, we give one away. And yeah, check them out. It's an incredible product for recovery, injury prevention, injury management, injury recovery. Check it out. Proven science. It's not hokey. those guys are legit, and they're bringing you Ryan Hughes today. So we're thankful for their support. We're going to jump into the Method Race Wheels front-end chatter. Method Race Wheels, making the lightest, fastest off-road wheels. Anything for your truck, sprinter, UTV, side-by-side, whatever you got. They make it. Check them out, methodracewheels.com. And you can get signed up to win a Dirtfish Rally Driving School with GL and I. What do we decide on? We can't do May. We're going to do April sometime?
Yeah, end of April.
So it's coming up quick. We're going to pull a winner here probably in the next week or two. So go get signed up. Snoqualmie, Washington. We are going to get nasty on some rally cars. It's going to be fun. So check those guys out, methodracewheels.com. And there's a link right on their website for the Whiskey Throttle Show. You just click in there. It'll say register to win. Do that, and you may win. So our Method Race Wheels front end chatter, a couple things we wanted to talk about today. There's a lot of buzz going on right now about Herlings. Got a broken foot, ankle, something going on, and he's not going to make the start.
Yeah.
He was optimistic he might miss one round and then be up to speed. It's not looking like that now. He's going to be 3-4 rounds probably before he would be able to start again. I think as fast as he is, that's a tough go to come back and win the title from that many points down.
Yeah. And with that said, you know, he may come back and win all the races, but we've seen with Cairoli and his consistency for Herlings, that's a tall order, which leads to the big buzz, which is rumor has it that he may come and do the U.S. Nationals, and that would be huge. And you know, if you look at it for him, you think it kind of makes sense. If you sort of are eliminated from the world championship hopes, he's a guy with an ego. He's told everyone I'm the best rider in the world. Now he probably thinks, you know what, I could go there. KTM would probably be 100% behind it. And he believes he'll come and win. And I tell you what, I think a lot of guys are nervous right now.
If you're a fan like me, yeah. I am like crossing my fingers he pulls the trigger on that.
Yeah.
For KTM, it makes sense. They've got Cairoli over there. He's a contender.
Yeah.
I mean, he's got to be the favorite with Herlings out.
Exactly.
You bring him over here. He jumps right in. You got three guys in a truck. That's not overwhelming. You can handle that. And this guy, I mean, you can say what you want. He's going to come out and win races. I mean, right away. I don't want to say he would destroy everybody, but certainly a title contender.
Like, oh,
him winning this championship is well within reason. So
I think if he comes over, I personally think he'd be the favorite. And I know there's some guys that would love to prove me wrong on that statement, but what he's shown in the past couple years is that no one can beat him on speed. Only one that can beat him is himself when he's injured. When he's injured, he doesn't win. When he's not injured, he wins. So,
But 12 races is different than coming over one and twosie here over here, you know.
It is a little different, but he's come over on different occasions and not had a problem adapting. I don't see it being a problem, and I think it would be a really cool feather in his cap. I know he's got no intentions of ever racing Supercross.
Yeah.
But to be kind of have this opportunity now to come over to the U.S. and win a U.S. title when he's probably not able to win that GP championship, man, it's got to be enticing to him. So I'm really anxious to see what happens.
Yeah.
What do you think? If you had to guess right now, you think he comes or not?
Based off if he's going to miss four rounds, I think they know deep down that's probably enough to eliminate him from the series, which I think, knowing a little bit of how Herlings operates, he's going to go, I want to go to the U.S., kick their ass, win a title, prove to everyone I'm the best, and I'll come back to Europe and continue winning more championships over here.
Yeah.
Marvin and Cooper are like, you know, you get the locker in the back, buddy.
Yeah,
you don't get the one in the front.
Frankly, as a guy,
they're going to give him the box van.
Yeah. I'm a guy, you know, I'm always going to root for the American rider in that situation. Doesn't mean I don't have a ton of respect for Herlings riding. He's incredible. But, man, it will give me an extra reason to root for Eli Tomac and some
for
of
sure.
our American boys to go out there and really.
And I think that those guys will have those races where they step up too, and it'll add to the great racing. And I think that's the biggest thing.
Well, let's. I've got my fingers crossed that happens. The other thing I wanted to chat about, Chad Reed at, what is he, like 36?
Yeah, he'll be 37 in a couple weeks.
Got on the podium this last weekend. That's incredible to me. I mean,
132nd time.
It's wild.
I've never entered that many races, I think, period. So when you look at that number, it is pretty staggering that at 37 he was able to do that again. And every now and then you see Reed and you watch him and you're like, he just looks like he found something. Like, you watch him some weeks and he looks good and solid. He's always in control, but the pace isn't there. And then all of a sudden, this last weekend,
I
don't know what he had in his protein shake or what, but he was just, he looked like a kid again out there, just really enthusiastic, a lot of body English. And we've seen that with Chad. Sometimes he just shows up and decides, you know what, I think it's about time.
This is just a complete speculation. I haven't asked Chad about it, but it seems like maybe it's tough for him to push as hard as he did for 20 laps, for 20 minutes. So in those Triple Crown events,
he can lay it all out in the 10-minute ones.
I'm just going to give it everything I got for 10 laps, 12 laps.
Yeah, because he did. And then even a couple of them near the end, there were a few guys that were on him, but he held strong. And, you know, when you do the math, he ended up third. And I thought that was pretty remarkable.
On the podium, that looked like a win to him. He was so excited.
Well, I mean, you've got to imagine at this day and age, a podium is probably like a win.
Yeah.
Especially when you don't go there expecting a podium. Like, I know Chad always says, I believe I can be on there. But he's also deep down a realistic guy. But I think he went there feeling like he could get a podium, and he got it. And that's a big accomplishment.
And he had a rough year last year.
Yeah.
Riding around, he had the bad ankle. Yeah. I don't think it ever really came around. He wasn't able to train. He looked puffy. He was not in racing shape. So I think that was good vindication for him. So really stoked for Chad Reed. Congrats, Reedy. Hopefully he can do it again.
As much as we like the youth coming up and doing well, a guy like Reed really pumps a lot of people up to want to watch the races.
Well, you know what? Too, another point is, and I've said it before, in our sport, it seems like, especially, I don't want to throw Alden under the bus, but since guys like Alden got involved, riders' careers have gotten shorter. So now the problem is the average fan, by the time they start figuring out the guy they like, they're retired. It's like a tear-off. It's on to the next guy and the next guy. Reed's the only guy that, if you've been kind of watching the last 10 years, is still there. So people resonate with that, and then it's also a feel-good story in the end. So, yeah. I mean, you see it at Anaheim. You got to look at the lines from the fans of the trucks. Reed's line is as long as anybody. Maybe only Roxon's is longer.
Well, stoked for Reedy. I want to go ahead and just bring up our guest right now. Let's get Ryan Hughes up here. Welcome him up to the stage. Ryan, come on up. He is brought to you by PowerDot. Again, you can go to powerdot.com/whiskeythrottle. Enter to win, or if you want to just buy one, you get 20% off by typing in Whiskey Throttle. So do that. Pick one of these up. Awesome, awesome units used by a lot of top racers, a lot of athletes in all kinds of sports. Ryno, welcome to the show, buddy.
Thank you. It's good to be here. I saw you guys doing this and thought, hey, you know, I think I need to be on that podcast since I'm sitting around a lot right now.
Well, that's what I figured, man. That was a good time to get you. You're exactly. back in the U.S. Healing up. That broken leg did not look fun, man.
Yeah. No, it's a sport we pick. You know, I wasn't, I was just kind of riding my buddy's bike. I rode it before and the suspension was very ill handling, you know, and I'm like, you got to fix this. So he took it in, got it fixed. And he was like, hey, why don't you ride it? We made some changes. I said, okay, cool. So I was going out there and it was probably like the fourth lap and just kind of warming up. Wasn't really feeling too sharp, but just went off this little drop off and my hand came off the bars. And I don't know. It was just one of those things. And as you guys know, in motocross, it doesn't take much. It takes one crash, one little stupid thing like that, and boom, I landed. I broke my femur, compounded it, and, you know, that's all she wrote. I kind of just said, all right, well, this is it. And now I just kind of put my life on hold for a little bit, and not the first time in my life that I hasn't tried to, you know, rush back or hurry back to get to something, to be something, to chase something, to accomplish something. I'm like, you know what? Since this last year has been a very tough year for me, I'm going to take a breath. I'm going to take a little breather for my first time in my life and just kind of allow life to open up and allow life to maybe teach me what this is meant to be. And,
How's that going? So good. Sometimes when you're a guy who's driven and always going, it's tough to just go.
Pump your brakes.
Okay.
Yeah.
You know, it's tough to sit back and just relax.
I think this time, you know, I can do it now because after this last year and then what happened, it's like life has really humbled me, you know, really, really, really humbled me. And I look at it with different eyes now. I look at it differently because, you know, I've always been the chaser. I've always been, I'm going to beat you. I'm going to accomplish this. I'm going to be better than you. I'm going to challenge you. I'm going to compete against you. Just go, go, go. And so you see life in a different way, but now you kind of take a step back and you're not really chasing anything or really needing anything in your life, and it allows you to take a little bit of a breath, you know. And again, I can't do anything about it, you know. It's not like I can go chase anything. I can't ride bicycles. I can't ride motorcycles. I can't even really, you know, get on the track so much. I mean, I've been to the track a little bit, a couple days doing that, but other than that, it's been good. I feel probably I'm more at peace right now than I've ever been in my life, and it's a good feeling because, as you guys know me, I've always had to chase something, and there's always something in my butt that I had to I don't know what it was, you know what I mean, that just drove me. And I've raced against both you guys, and I probably wasn't the funnest guy to race against, and but now, you know, now I would buy you guys a nice beer and a coffee let's go take a walk in the park, bud.
But you know, I think that's all relative, you know. When you're racing, that's what everyone lined up there to do, was to beat all the guys around them. And like you've said, I've heard you say, and I felt the same way, it's hard to be big buddies with guys that you want to beat. You want to be motivated against them. And it's almost like a different mindset when you're racer mode and then, all right.
Well, yeah, it's a really hard dynamic to be buddies with a guy and then, okay, we put our goggles on and I hate you. Like, I'm battling with you right now. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because it's not a chess game. It's a fight, you know, racing is. So
yeah, I remember whenever I do a school, I always start talking about mindset and about how you have to ride offensively. You have to think offensively. You have to think that you're the man. You have to think that you're better than you kind of already are. And I always bring up a story because, again, you know, as you say, you know, myself and Grant have always got along. But when we started racing against each other and then we started competing against each other and we started going for the championship against each other, things changed.
Yeah.
It's not like I didn't like him and not like he didn't like me, but then it was like, you know what, screw you. And we'd start bringing those things. And I always remember at Steel City 2003, we were lined up next to each other. You probably don't remember this, but this is, you know, kind of an ass then. I remember lining up next to you and I hit you in the arm and you looked over and I said, hey, I go, you better get a good jump. And you looked over and you said, why? I said, because I'll cut your ass off if you don't. And you didn't get a good jump on my hat and cut him off. And that's just, you know, that's just the type of person I was at that time. And then we came back in the truck. I said, hey, man, I told you what I was going to do, you know.
And you can't be pissed. You got to look at it and go, well, get the damn start, man. Put yourself in that position. And let's be honest, if the shoe's on the other foot and I had the jump and you're next to me, I'm pinching you off and going to that turn.
Yeah.
So
100%. So that, you know, that's racing, but that's kind of the cool thing is that you can have stories like this, and now me and him can, you know, joke around and laugh about it and be friends, and it's you know, it's dust swept under the rug, so to speak. Yeah. But
and I love that about this kind of career of our lives is somebody I like. I could bring Greg Schnell, Brian Deegan, any of those guys on here, and I hated them when I raced.
Yeah.
But, like, it's, you know, you look at it back, like you said, now with more perspective, and you're like, okay.
Yeah, yeah, it's, we it's a motorcycle race. You know, like, we're not curing cancer, dude.
No, you know? And so it's cool that we can look back and kind of even laugh at ourselves. Like, I was such a dick, you know.
Yeah.
But that was what you had to do to get your head right, to do what you had to do.
Well, even another little funny one was, like, I mean, I remember you and Brownie didn't like each other for a while. And then I see him, and he's, like, using Ryno Power products and stoked to be a part of family. And I'm like... That's when you know things have been swept under the rug and everyone's cool.
Yeah. No, it's, that's a big, you know, a couple people I've had some issues with, you know, I've had a few in my life. but yeah, like Brownie, Alessi, all these guys, you know, are using my product, Ryno Power, and we support them 100%. And we're so stoked to have people like that with names like that to be representing our brand. And that's kind of funny how things go full circle. But that just shows the respect. Yeah. In the sport. And, you know, people say, who's your enemy or who don't you like in motocross? I'm like, man, you know what? There's not a person. Yeah. There's not one person that I have an issue with or that I don't like or that I have ill words for. I really don't. I mean, you know.
That's good, though.
This sport is an amazing sport. And, yeah, it's very competitive, very cutted, you know, cutthroat and, you know, a little bit backstabbing and this and that. But when it comes down to it, man, we're a community and a strong community. And, you know, I was blown away with how many people – you know, texted me out of the woodwork that actually I haven't talked to in years, you know, and when I broke my leg, and that just shows, you know, the brotherhood that we have, and there's not too many sports that can have that, I believe, but I think it comes from everybody understanding the risk that we take, but also everybody, you know, understanding just how amazing the sport is. There's nothing like it, man.
No.
There's
That's
nothing
crazy.
Like it. It's really cool.
It is amazing, and it's frustrating at times for people. I get this all the time. People go, man, I don't ride anymore because I don't have the money, or I got hurt really bad and my wife won't let me, or whatever the reason is. And they try, like, I've tried mountain biking, I tried getting into golf, I tried this, I can't replace
nothing
it.
Nothing substitutes.
Nothing will replace it.
No.
And that's frustrating because as you get older, sometimes it's like, all right, I better get into a UTV and just go start doing that.
With age comes a cage.
Yeah, but damn it, you just can't replace the feeling.
Now, in motocross, you know, I tell everybody, I guess the most, you know, especially when I go around and people ask me, what are you doing? I say, I coach motocross. It's the most dynamic sport on the earth because there's newness every lap. Mm-hmm. Every lap, a section can change.
Yeah.
You know, there's so much diversity to it, too, because every different type of bump, every different type of soil, every different type of turn, jump, this, that. There's no other motorsport that even comes paired to it because most motorsports are on a fixed surface. Yes, the concrete gets a little bit slippery or this or that, but it does not change shape. And also concrete is concrete, so to speak, of asphalt. But ours, man, there's nothing like it. It's so dynamic. And then the consequence is just massive. And so once you get done racing, as you guys know, now you're like, shit, now what? You know, you because, again, your whole life wraps around you when you're the racer.
Yeah,
it's Ryan's life. It's Ryan's world. Yeah. It's Grant's world. It's David's world.
And the family and everyone else just
sitting
around it.
And then once you're done, now you're like, now what? You know, now who am I? And but that's when it gets a little bit scary for athletes because they start chasing the wrong things. Like they say, every athlete dies twice. They die when they say they're done because now who are you? And then they die when we die.
Dude, that's really good.
Because again, once you say you're done, now who are you? That energy that
you've lost
that
your
woke
identity.
You up every day to challenge you, motivate you, inspire you, you know, the consequences, the money, the fame, everything that you wake up for every day, that consistency, that routine. In the beginning, it's cool. But then after a while, then after a while, it's like, whoa, this is normal life? Kind of boring. Right?
Yeah.
And so I had to go. Yeah.
I had to go.
You know, I went through some depression that way because I'm sure all of us did. It's a tough pill to swallow when you're that guy.
Sure.
Yeah. You know?
I think every racer does unless you've got something to draw you to something else, right? Like, I got really lucky because I was already writing for Davey.
Mm-hmm.
So to go work for that magazine was an easy transition. And it kept me riding, kept me involved. And then I ended up finding something else I was passionate about, firefighting, and I went and did that.
Mm.
And that provides a little bit of excitement occasionally, right?
Oh, yeah.
But it still doesn't replace motocross. And I tell people this, when you're out riding, your brain, all of the distractions, the day-to-day, your kids, the family, bills, blah, it's gone, and you're just in that moment riding. And, like, It's therapeutic.
Yeah, and that's why I think our sport's dominated by older riders like myself. You know, it is because, again, at this age, you know, it's like you have accomplished career-wise, money-wise, you've had a family, this, and it comes down to now what, and you see all these guys kind of get back into it. And again, just like you're talking about, it's almost meditative for us. It's like it puts you in this present moment, and that's very addicting. You know what I mean? It really is, and there's other things in life that create that, and that's what we're addicted to. But it almost takes you out of, you know, it separates you from kind of what's happening in life. You know what I mean? Yeah. It gives you a little bit of a breather, a break, and just, again, the newness. Every single lap, there's something new, and it's amazing.
You're getting me pumped up to go ride. I'm like, you know what? You're right, man.
There's a phenomenon right now called workism. If you Google it, there's been some stuff in the news and stuff about it. A lot of millennials and whatever getting into this where you get just completely consumed in your work, and your whole identity personally is wrapped up in what you do and what you accomplish professionally, right? Mm-hmm. And I feel like I was laughing as I'm reading this. I'm going, that's every motocrosser ever, you know, because it's all about you. It's all about, okay, it's all about me today. I'm going to do this, this, that, and that. I don't care what anyone else, you know, girlfriend second, family second, everything else is second. Mm-hmm. And you kind of have to be that way, I guess, when you're really committed to something and trying to accomplish it. But that leads to, like you mentioned, that first death when you finally quit. Mm-hmm. Now you need to figure out who the hell you are. And that's tough for a lot of people.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, and I've always, you know, I have this story too, is, you know, because when I found motocross, I don't know if it was you guys too, but man, it was an absolute obsession. I mean,
really?
nothing ever came before that motorcycle or interrupted or got me off my train. And I think this is the first time that I haven't really focused on motocross for a few weeks. You know, other than that, it's been always just, how do I get back? How can I be better? I'll teach even with broken backs and stuff like that. Now I took a breath. But at my schools, I always tell, you know, I always try to get these kids now, because these days, these kids don't have this passion. They don't have this determination. They don't have this self-confidence. They don't, and you kind of have to teach them. So I always tell them, I go, nothing comes before this sport if you want to do it, because your career is only this big, and hopefully your life is this big. Yeah. So I remember with my ex-wife, when we started going out when I was 21, we were sitting in my garage, and it was kind of new, a couple, you know, month or so like that into it. And I said, hey, you see that motorcycle right there? And she says, yeah. I said, that's my first love. I go, nothing comes before that motorcycle. If you can accept that, we can go out. If you can't, we got to stop this right now, because nothing will replace that. And it was true. And it was all the way until maybe right now that motocross hasn't always been my absolute love and the first thing in my life. You know what I mean? Now I put somebody else a little bit in front of that right now, and also life. You know, it's kind of taking a little bit of a back seat, but it's good. It's good to take a break, you know?
Yeah. Well, I want to get to a bunch of your personal life and stuff, but I want to jump back and kind of go through your racing career first. But before we even get to that, you didn't do any pain meds. You took no pain meds with a broken femur. And you're like filming them, putting it on Instagram. I'm like, this freaking guy. I broke my femur at San Diego, and I was passing out from the pain. And really? I know they're all different, because it depends on where the bone's sitting, if it's pushing up against tissue that has a lot of nerve endings, and if the muscle spasms, it'll pull the bones apart. Mm. So I've gone on calls where guys have broken femurs, and they're like, yeah, my leg kind of hurts, and it's, you know. Yeah. And then other guys, they're screaming, you know. Yeah. So I know there's a difference, but still.
Yeah, I don't know. I didn't take any pain medicine, except they gave me a little bit before surgery, of course, and I took a few of them, Percocets or whatever, the day after, just because of swelling and this and that. But then after that, I just stopped. I don't. Yeah. For me, it's not trying to be tough. I kind of go off this theory, is that we're having a problem with these opiates in this world. And so why, you know, be the guy that doesn't take them for the people that maybe has problems for them? You know, like for me, and I wake up in the morning, hey, thank you for allowing me to open my eyes, and let me honor that for the people that aren't here or can't see. Yeah. Or thank you for allowing me to feel the ground when I'm walking. And I honor that and respect that for all the people that I know, my friends, that can't walk. Mm-hmm. You get what I'm saying? Yeah. So I wanted, you know, it's kind of that way. You know, everything's in energy. So if I'm one that is trying to, you know, not follow that path and go a different road, and not by being tough, but just to honor these guys that are hooked on these things, that are stuck. Because, again, America's 5% of the world population. Mm-hmm. It takes 80% of all pharmaceutical drugs in the world. I don't want anyone to go down that road, but I'm just, you know, that's kind of
become an epidemic.
Oh,
you're right, though.
And
the problem is, in our sport, is it's not if you get injured, it's when. And I remember
they're giving these little 12-year-olds.
Yeah, and no one ever warned me. And I remember after my knee reconstruction, I remember one day I woke up and I'm like, I'm going to stop now. I don't need them. And it had been like a month.
Mm-hmm.
And
sweats.
Then I felt so ill. I'm like, I need one just to not feel so ill. It wasn't the pain. It was just the ill and the withdrawals. And then I'm like, I've got to sort this out. And I mean, and it was. It was, but it was something that I had to wean off. But I'm like, it's so easy. And I wanted to get off. But you see a lot of people, they get just consumed and they kind of can't.
Yeah, it starts to become you. And again, it's not like I didn't take anything for pain medicine, you know? But
I just know that medic had fentanyl. He could have made it so much better for you on that flight.
We'll just keep that, you know, what I took a little quiet.
It's legal.
Yeah, you know, it's Twitch. Where's Twitch?
An organic breakfast.
Don't panic. It's organic. Isn't that just
don't worry. Twitch made him a smoothie.
All right. Go.
Let's go back, Ryno. Tell me, you're an Escondido guy, right?
Isn't that what you're born and raised in Escondido, yep.
And so who got you into riding? How'd you get started? What were you riding?
We always rode, you know, like three-wheelers and motorcycles around the house. We went to the desert and stuff like that. My brother started racing 78, 79. I didn't race. I was playing football, soccer, and that's what I wanted to be, professional that. And then my brother had to quit because my dad had worked at San Onofre and had to work graveyard and all that. So
the power plant?
Yeah, he didn't have time to do it, so they quit. Then 84, they started racing again, and they wanted me to come out because I was pretty good on a motorcycle just because, just even having fun. And I remember going to the race, and I was always like, no, I don't want to race. I was scared for some reason. And then we went out to Barona Oaks on Saturday, and they wanted me to go out and practice. And I was like in the bed, I was in the front of the truck crying, no, Dad, no, I don't want to go, just crying. And they finally got me out there, and I'm riding around the track, and I fell over.
Was it this bike?
No, I was on an 80. Oh, okay. It was 1984 on an 80.
Dude, this is great.
Right here. Check that out, dude. JR50.
No gloves.
No gloves, no goggles.
But even the head's tilting like he's posing for the camera. Like, look at me, guys.
Yeah, trying to throw up a little roost. Look at that, Mom.
You are throwing a roost.
Look at that, dude. Oh, that was huge back then. I was probably looking back at my roost right now.
Exactly.
So they took the picture a little earlier because if they took it later, my head would have been all the way back like that.
Exactly.
So I went out there and I fell over and, I just fell over and a guy stopped on a big bike and picked me up and got me going again. I was like, oh, wow, these guys are nice. And that's all it took. And then I won my first six races. And from there, I started in 84. I turned pro 84, 9-11 beginner. 1988, I was 125, 250 pro. 1990, I finished fifth in my first national. So in 6 years, I started to finish fifth in my first national. I mean,
that's very
quick.
First national, you got a fifth?
Yeah.
Wow.
First moto ever. I got fifth, and I tied for fifth overall. But in 6 years, I went from starting to that, you know. So my career was like super fast, and it was like I was just going, and each year just better and improving. And then, you know, I broke my wrist, and that's when things kind of started going a little bit the other direction. And then I just became the probably the most injured person in the sport.
I say this all the time because I guess it doesn't always translate because some guys didn't do this, but I think it's good that you played a bunch of other sports because one, you know what you're missing or not missing.
Yeah.
And I think that develops athleticism, coordination, hand-eye coordination, a lot of stuff that we need everything in motocross, right? So I think it's good that you play other sports.
Yeah, I think it's good for everybody to, you know, again, the better athlete you are, the better at everything you are.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So that's why I always tell everybody when we train, let's mix it up. Let's not be a one-dimensional person. And even with my normal fitness day-to-day, I try to have a well-rounded fitness instead of be just a one-trick pony. Oh, look how great I'm on a bicycle. Okay, but you're not flexible, you have no strength, you have no balance, you have no coordination. And again, life is asking for a lot more than just being that. So that's what I kind of do, and the same thing with when you coach riders. It's like, let's make you well-rounded. Mm-hmm. It's just like, hey, this guy's only good in the sand. Well, why? Let's get you in the mud, the hard pack, this. Let's make you more of a well-rounded rider type of thing.
Mm-hmm. So who are the guys you grew up racing with? Anybody that kind of came up with you? Sounds like you grew so damn quick that you probably left everybody behind.
Yeah. I had a big group of riders that I raced with, my brother and, you know, a bunch of friends, but then slowly everybody just kind of faded out and they all kind of almost somewhat went down the wrong roads, you know? Excuse me. And I was the only one that kind of stuck with it. I just had this, you know, this determination, this passion for it. I would say the person that I grew up with and kind of have friends with the most was McGrath. Mm-hmm. And we became friends at 15 years old, and we used to ride together, and we'd be in the front yard making jumps, these skinny jumps, you know what I mean? You know, we'd be doing one-handers. We'd be doing one-handers and stuff and just thinking we're the man, you know what I mean? And so I would say in my life, I've been friends, you know, with Jeremy probably longer than anybody, you know, just because we started racing against each other when we were 15, intermediate.
Okay.
And we battled, you know what I mean? So, yeah. So that's probably the longest one. But other than that.
Plus, you guys were on that sort of same timeline with you guys were turning pro and.
Yeah, because
even
came
from 125 to 250s, things like that.
He came up quick, too. He started late and kind of the same as you. I mean, I'm looking back at when I started, mine was a slow, gradual progression to the pro ranks. You were kind of like, what?
I just went boom, you know, and then it kind of, you know, flattened out and he took off, you know, and I had some injuries. And but, you know. That's life.
Yeah, for sure. So what year did you get into, like, amateur nationals where you were actually winning and starting to have success?
Let's see. First amateur national was 86 because I just got into 125 novice. And Mike Craig, you know, I was friends with Mike Craig, and his dad's like, man, your son's riding pretty good. Let's go to Ponca City. And my dad's like, Ponca City, what's up? Okay, so we jumped in his truck and went there, and that was my first big national, I think, six or something like that. Then I went back in 88, 89. You know, 88 is I was intermediate, 89 I was, you know, just first year pro. Then 1990, then I demolished everything. I won 10 amateur titles that year. I won two titles at every single national around the, you know, from Texas to World Mini, Ponca, Tennessee, and many Olympics. So that was a really good year for
me. You guys were all in at that point.
Yeah, I was. It was done, man. This is my world.
And did your dad love it? Was he the whole family?
Yeah, my dad. I mean, he was there. I mean, that picture, I haven't seen a picture of my dad in a while, and that one came up this morning with myself and my girlfriend looking, and it brought tears to my eyes, you know, because I haven't seen, you know, my dad died when I was 21. And so right in the middle of my career, and he's the one that, you know, paid, worked, you know, on the bike, drove, everything. Yeah. I mean, that he never one time did he ever raise his voice at me in motocross, ever one time.
Really?
Never. Did he ever raise his voice or did he ever get mad at me? And he filmed every single moto that I ever raced in my whole entire life till the day he died. I mean, I'd go to Ponca City. You know, we had Ponca qualifiers, 8 motos in a day. He'd work on my bike and film from start to finish. But I believe that was one reason why I came up so quick. Because every day after school, I'd come home and just watch my races. What did I know what I was watching? No, but I knew when there's good races, that would sink in. When there's bad races, that would sink in. Or when I went to the track that I'm going to race on that weekend, I'd be able to replay it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I feel that was a huge, huge help. So I tell the parents, hey, film your kids. No, they're just talking shit over here. You know? I'm like, you guys are missing a huge thing because your kid could learn so much from himself.
Yeah.
Because you think you're doing something, but you're not.
Well, in your head, it feels a certain way. Yeah. Right? Like, oh, my style's perfect through this turn. You watch
it. I've said that, too. Ooh. And I've watched it back, and I'm like, oh, wow. Good thing you filmed that, because I had no idea it looked that bad. Yeah.
But then on the other thing, you sometimes feel like crap, and then you're like, you know what? Actually, I'm riding pretty good.
Yeah.
You know, so there's a different side to it. But, yeah, my dad was, you know, so supportive. And then, he died in 1994.
Right before San Diego, if I remember.
Right before San Diego, yeah, because I got the news. You know, I didn't get the news that your dad had cancer. I got the news that your dad's dying. You know, it was terminal, died. 3 months,
he
was
dead.
Oh, yeah. Oh. Yeah, he came out of the bathroom one day, and he told my mom, he goes, hey, Kathy, I'm dying. And my mom's like, what? He goes, I'm dying. And I guess, you know, there's a bunch of blood or whatever, so they took him to the hospital, they checked him out, and said, it's terminal. Jeez. There's nothing they could do. So I got, you know, 3 months, and then that was kind of a tough time because I was just, you know, I just moved out of the house. You know, I was my own man.
You're
you know,
a young
1994,
man,
I'm one of the best in the world. I'm supposed to be chasing this championship. It's like my dad's dying, but I, you know, it's almost like I have dealt with it way more now than I did back then. It's almost like I had to push it away and just focus on my career. But now are the times, you know, maybe not now, but, you know, a while ago are the times that I dealt with it most because now it starts to come in, it starts to sink in, you know what I mean? Because you pushed everything to the side. But I was a very determined, focused, you know, person, so I'm able to do that. I have that gift to be able to push things to the side and still focus on what needs to be focused on. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, he died, and that was actually before Anaheim. I didn't even qualify for the race. You know,
I remember because I was racing that year. Yeah. I remember hearing about it and like, going, oh man.
Yeah,
Mitch was helping me with bikes, and so
And then the next weekend was San Diego, which was my home race, and I won my first race. You know, so it was just like,
that's
whoa,
what it was. I remember something around.
Yeah, huh? It's insane. It was insane, and so that was kind of a springboard to the rest of my career. Just after you win your first race, you're like, okay, man, I finally got this damn monkey off my back. You know,
yeah.
And so
did the cancer have anything to do with him working at the power plant?
You know what? I don't know. I would have to say yeah. I'd have to say yeah. You know,
curious.
I mean, I have an intuition that yeah. Mm-hmm. And, but I can't put my finger on it. You know what I mean? And it is what it is. But, yeah, I mean, you know, that's one of the biggest things. I always tell people that still have the fathers and stuff, like, hey, pay attention to them, man. Give them your time and make sure that, you know, they know, because, you know, that was one of the biggest things in my life that I've missed. I've never had a father to ask questions for when I'm down or when I'm confused or when I'm lost or is this normal? Is, hey, Dad, what do I do? Mm-hmm. I've never had a man to rely on. You know, I've always had to make my own decisions, and sometimes I didn't make them correct. But, and it's hard to ask a woman. You know,
it's different.
When a man's dealing with certain things.
So I always tell the kids, man, you know, when I teach them, I go, look, this is it's a two-way street. It takes two banks to make a river flow. One, you have to respect your dad for working his ass off and giving up his retirement to make your career happen. But then the dad, hey, you have to understand how tough the sport is and what your kid's going through. So you guys got to have respect for each other. When you can have respect for each other, then you can make a team.
Yeah.
But if you guys are battling each other, it's not going to work. Mm. You know what I mean?
Yep.
And so, you know, it's kind of a big thing I always teach kids to have respect for their mom and dad, because you never know, you know?
Yeah, I respect my parents because I was always afraid of a backhand. So I was very respectful. You know, my old man, he was a little bit on the tough side. But what's funny now is without racing, we hang out, we get along great.
That's
like,
cool.
We're like good buddies. And it's the dynamics change over the years. Yeah. It went from almost like, hey, have you done your training? You get up and da-da-da-da. Now it's like, how's it going? How's the show? Everything good? How was Ryno?
Yeah.
Tell Pinga, say hi. You know, off we go. You want to go grab lunch? I'm like, okay, cool, let's do it.
Yeah, you're like, Dad, I'm going to go do this. Hey, just chill.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, like, who is this guy?
Yeah. Back in the day, he'd fatten your lip, huh?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Now, at least like it sounds like you and your dad spent a lot of time and had good memories. And you were saying in 90 how you just dominated. When did the factories sort of come around? I mean, had it been close to that sort of time, right, when you had the factory supports going, hey, we need this kid?
Yeah, so it was in 1990. You know, I won everything and then got fifth in the first national. Then after that, I finished top 10 the rest of the nationals too, after Loretta's, you know, because that's the whole deal. In 91, Honda came to me, Peak Honda, and I had a contract with them and this and that. But the year before, they kind of did Honda did some weird thing with Denny Stevenson and somebody else, where they had a ride, and then they cut their lunch. And so for some reason, I was a little bit nervous about that. And then Kawasaki came to me with a bigger offer.
Factory
support.
Okay.
So they gave me a box fan and this and all factory parts, but I was factory support. I was outside the truck.
Okay.
And, you know, they gave me a much bigger deal, like $20,000 more. You know,
hey, that's a lot of money.
But back
when
then,
you're a young guy coming up.
Yeah, but back then,
that's
it was like,
say, $150,000 now, probably, right?
Yeah. So I went with Kawasaki, and that, you know, we all have our times that we go back and find out which decisions didn't make sense. And that was one I didn't make the best decision. I went after money instead of after maybe you know, team. But we didn't know Peak was going to be that good,
exactly.
And Pro Circuit was going to be that good and stuff like that. So 1991, I was factory support. Almost won, you know, I think I lost the first East Coast Supercross by a tire, myself and Swingster. Mm. Yeah, I went off to start, got bumped off to start, was dead last, and I think I rode one of my best races I ever rode in my life. It came from dead last all the way to first, past Swingster, and then the last corner, he railed the outside, and I went to the inside, and it was almost like Roxon and Webb. He beat me by like that much, and I'm just like, oh my God, you know? And the guy, I was so pissed because during the day, everybody's like, oh, yeah, Twinkster, he's at Waffle Place. What's a
Waffle House?
Yeah, Waffle House. He's getting a big steak, you know, and this and I'm like, dude, I'm going to kick this guy's ass, you know? And, of course, Twinkster, he was so talented,
so
you know?
Good.
And then after that, then I rode my first 250 Supercross at San Diego, and I finished ninth overall, you know? That's pretty good, and just getting off. Then I went to Tokyo Dome. And that's kind of when things happen. I endoed at a jump, and I broke my wrist.
Oh, that's where you did your wrist?
Yeah, I broke my scaphoid there. And then back in the day, you know, we didn't, you know, I got an x-ray, nothing. And then, so I was like, nothing's broken. I'm going to a chiropractor every day, and he's freaking yanking on it. Oh, we got this. It's jammed, man. It's jammed. And for 3 months, I rode with it broken. And then I finally went to Jeff Spencer. We got an x-ray and did this. Or actually, he just pushed in here, and I'm like, ah.
Yeah.
He's like, ah, okay, let's go get this x-rayed. And then and then it was broken, and the bone was dead and this and that. So, you know, that took three surgeries.
Because after it starts moving, it goes from being a bone to like a joint.
Yeah, just because it doesn't get any blood to it. So I have a screw in here, but it's still like, broken, but it's holding, it just holds it together.
Well,
I got two of them, baby.
I doubled up too.
We are such a jacked up bunch.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, if I told you my injury list, it'd be...
Five out of six possible risks.
Yeah, you can't get much better than that.
Oh, boy.
So, and that never... Did you have it removed, or what did you end up doing? Or did they pin it? Or?
They took bone off my hip, put it on there, and it was a non-fusion. So I weighed 3 months, I rode three times, and it's hurting. I went back, and it was a non-fusion, so then they put a screw in it. But then what happened is this is all the movement I have in my wrist, you know, for my whole career.
Yeah.
And so that is where I feel... A lot of my injuries started because I rode this way, so I'm already starting out in a bad position. Start out in a bad position, end up in a bad position. Start out in a good position, end up in a good position, no matter how small or big the mistake or bobble is.
Yeah.
So that's where I felt like things started kind of going wrong a little bit, and that's I was always kind of to the side, and then that's where I had so many injuries on my right side, it felt like. Mm. And so you start, you know, there's a lot of times I had time to ponder laying on the couch of what's going on and why, and that's the only thing that I could think of how my technique was. Now the technique that I teach, I wouldn't have had such a problem. Mm. I wouldn't have had such a problem.
But, I mean, what can you do? You just got to re-grip bigger?
Oh, it was full re-grip, man. Yeah, it is all or nothing. And that's why when you guys behind you or whatever, you just all or nothing.
Just controlling it with the
clutch. It's a light switch, baby. No, it was so bad that when I rode for the factory Honda that I'd pull the slide up through the carb. You know, because it was just so, you know, I'd break throttle cables after a while. And I don't know why, you know.
That's crazy.
Just because there wasn't anything.
When did you hook up with Chad Watts? Was that first year at Factory Cowie Support?
1990, I think. 1990 we hooked up, and we did that whole year. And then 91 we were on the road. And then 92 I started the year out. No, 91, yeah, I broke the wrist. 92 was a good year. I think I finished, I don't know what I finished in the Nationals, but that, and then that's when he hit the truck and almost killed himself there.
Yeah. You don't know the story, Chad Watts, who went on to work for Pichon and Ricky Carmichael, had an amazing career as a mechanic, now running Watts Perfections. Is he still doing that?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Back in North Carolina?
Yep. North Carolina.
I lived with Chad for a couple of years, so I got to know him pretty well. And he was driving the box van up to Washougal, right? And yes, ran into the back of a semi and just damn near killed himself. And he had like half of his intestines taken out. He's got this huge scar from ear to ear. And so he got into, you know, bodybuilding later on. So he's drinking all these protein shakes and he doesn't have the guts to process it. Yeah. So he is just a constant farting machine.
Yeah, he's a straight pipe.
And our house smelt like an outhouse.
Yeah.
At a music festival all the time.
Straight pipe. Yeah, so he had a problem with driving super fast, and we'd always get on him, and it was like his thing that he could go across the country in a day, and just, he, you know, did that. But from that time, then our box van was destroyed, and then so Team Kawasaki put me in the semi. Mm. I was like, yeah. So, you know, I'm rubbing up the Wardy and this and that. I'm like, man, yeah. So it's cool. And then in 93, I was, I think I was Team Kawasaki, and then 94, I went to Mitch, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you kept a good relationship with him, even though you turned down the Honda deal. He didn't.
No. I mean, me and Mitch have always seen eye to eye. We've always had a great relationship just because he's always respected the effort that I put into it.
Yeah.
You know, maybe I didn't do it correct or maybe I didn't come off the best, but you couldn't deny the effort that I put into it.
Yeah.
And so that's why we all always got along.
And knowing Mitch, that really is the one thing he cares about.
Yeah.
If you put in the effort, he's even said, I remember he got. 2006 on the West Coast, I was leading the points, and then it was a mud race in San Francisco. Shocker.
Yep.
But I got a decent start. I tried to jump the triple, cased it, crashed again. And I thought he was going to be pissed because I sucked. I almost blew the championship that night. And I remember he came and sat down and he said, you know, I'm not mad at all. He goes, how can I be mad at someone that tried too hard? He goes, that was your only mistake. You tried too hard. Because I still laughed and said, my only mistake? Yeah. The whole night was a mistake.
Yeah, I didn't even showed up.
Yeah, and I still remember he said, you just tried too hard. Like, just pump your brakes a little bit. And I
was See, that's the softer, kinder, gentler Mitch. Yeah. Back in 94, 95. He would have tore your head off.
Yeah.
Probably. That's what I had heard
Mitch
about
him. Mitch was ornery back then.
Yeah. But I never had, like I said, never had a problem. Yeah. But I always remember, you know, I'd wake up, I'd do my running, do my cycling, do my riding, and he'd call and be like, hey, he'd call me every day. How's it going? Oh, it's going good. I did this. Yeah, right. You should probably go run again. Okay. You know, and I'd go running again. But every day he'd say, yeah, you should probably go do some more. Okay.
When I signed with him, we were at the test track, and I remember we were done testing, and I literally had taken my gear off, and I'm pulling off my wet, soggy socks. And he's like, you know what I was thinking? It'd be really cool if you could do a 15-lap moto. I haven't seen you do one. I'm like, I did like four earlier. He goes, but I haven't seen it. Yeah. And I'm like, well, can you come out tomorrow? He's like,
No, I get stuff to
do. Just put your gear on. And I'm like, dude, I'm buggered. He's like, come on, please. And he goes, just put your gear on. He goes, you don't have to set lap records. There he is with the stopwatch, right up against the edge of the track. Yeah. So as I come, he's physically doing this. And I'm like, mother. And I'm like, and I angry rode 15 laps.
Yeah,
and I got in my van with my gear on. I'm like, see you tomorrow, guys. And off I went.
Yeah, it's good times.
I probably needed that.
Yeah.
And you were a JT guy. That's kind of my first. I remember you from JT ads, and I wrote for.
I've seen some of those old pictures before, and I'm like, little stud. Male model.
Yeah, all the Dalmatian stuff.
Yes,
because the Lachine Dogger was my hero. Yeah. You know, Dogger was my hero. I still have his pants and this and that, and just the way he rode, and he rode the same gear, you know. And then again, Brock Glover, all my heroes wore JT, and then it was a local, you know, company, so to speak, down in Otay, San Diego. And we just hooked on. And dude, when was it, 91? Yeah, I signed a contract for JT for $60,000.
That was big.
That's
big,
huge.
Money. Yeah.
Back in 91?
Yeah, that's
that
huge.
That was huge. Jeez. Yeah. Then I got hurt and they didn't pay me at all. So yeah, my accountant was their accountant, so.
Oh, I see.
He couldn't really fight.
I bet
it,
he
you know?
Got paid.
Yeah.
I bet the accountant got paid.
So, but it was good. Those days were amazing, man. Amazing.
Yeah, I remember going with Button down to Candomar, Mexico. You guys ever do show? Yeah. We do photo shoots down there, and then obviously, what's the place down there in San Diego?
Palm Avenue.
Palm Avenue.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that was crazy. Yeah.
So, what about the switch to pro circuit? did you feel like you were being demoted? Were you happy with that? I mean, you were coming out of the factory Cowie truck. I know at the time, I mean, what was the vibe for you?
It was, you know, a little bit like, okay, I'm going backwards, but it wasn't because I was kind of a little bit of a stepchild, you know, because, you know, they had the factory guys, you know, Wardy and Kudrowski, I think, or whatever. And I think it was Osho and those guys. So that was their main concern. And then they just handled me in the background. So this, when I went to Mitch, then it was like full-fledged.
You were the guy.
Yeah, I was the guy, and I still had factory parts. They, you know, Kawasaki supplied me with all the factory stuff, and then everybody else on the team, you know, got A-kit stuff or just stock stuff with better equipment. I don't know.
Yeah.
So I still had the factory support, but just with Mitch, and then I could see how much more how much more attention was paid on myself because it was a 125 effort. Mm-hmm. And so that definitely helped me out, and that definitely springboarded my career, and I had two really good years in 94, 95, and then 96 went back to factory Kawasaki.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So those, I remember, obviously, I would just started racing pro in 94, 95. So, and we were teammates in 95.
Yep.
But I remember your battles with, like, Henry at High Point? Delmont.
Yeah, Steel City, yeah.
I remember watching that on a Terra Firma or something.
That was like vintage Ryno to me. And so you guys just. And Henry was a scrapper, too.
Yeah, yeah.
So you two were at it.
What's funny is I didn't realize that of Henry until someone told me down there. They're like, oh, no, Henry, like, he's made look like a soft guy, but he's ready to throw down. I'm like, really?
Yeah, because we were going for the championship, you know, myself, Henry, and and Lampson.
Oh, Lampson.
Lampson. Okay. So I was third, Lampson second, and we were really close, and we were only like 15 or points away from Henry, and maybe 20-something, I don't know. So Henry wrapped it up the first moto. And so second moto, you know, I was trying, I wanted to get second overall. And I remember after the start, you go down the hill, and I came inside Henry, and I was like, whoa, shit, no brakes. I'm going to F and hit you. And he's all, yeah. I'm like, yeah. And I don't think he liked that very much. So he had nothing to lose. Yeah. And then coming down the hill, he just freaking T-boned me. Yeah. You know, so I got off my bike and little Mike Tyson, pa-pa! And then he grabbed me by the helmet and had me backwards. And yeah.
That's like a Terra Firma highlight, you know.
I was just that kid in South Africa going like, yeah, these guys get after it.
Yeah.
We usually fight off the
race.
Did
you talk afterwards?
Oh, not after that. I was, you know, I told him you come by my truck, you know, this and that. But now, you know, if we see each other and this and that, and even before that, it was, you know, we laugh about it and stuff. And
Doug was fun. You were always aggro. You could tell you'd punch someone's lights out, but Doug was always so, like, meek and, you know, mellow, but on the track.
Oh, yeah. He wasn't afraid.
Probably not afraid.
Like Brown a little bit. Brownie was always, like, wouldn't say much off the track, but he put his helmet on and he just ride straight into you.
Oh, yeah. He just T-boned you.
Hey, so I got to bring up something else from that year, too. 94, I was, like, rookie. Randy Lawrence is my mechanic. We're in a box fan. Yeah, Suzuki support. And I'm, like, just – because I'm living with Randy and Phil.
Yeah, yeah.
And he's hanging out with you, and I'm going riding with you and Jeremy a lot and just, like, you know – trying to take in as much as I can. And we go back to Redbud. And we're with Button and Phil and you, a handful of us. And there was that empty Walmart. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, yeah.
There was this empty Walmart that had a parking lot. And then the big building sat here. And there was this side road that went up a big ramp to a top parking lot. And these guys have been talking about this rental car jump that they had every year, right? So Rhino's driving, and I'm in the car with Rhino, and he's like, yeah, we're going to jump this thing. I'm like, mm-mm, let me out. I'm out. So I get out and watch, and I think Button was maybe in the car with you, and you guys, you're doing 60 freaking miles an hour at the top of this thing, and it's like a Dukes of Hazzard moment. And it just goes quiet, and you're sailing this Chevy Corsica through the air.
Corsica.
Boom, freaking oil pan blows up, and you're like laughing, and I'm like, they just ruined this car. Like, I just couldn't believe what I was seeing, dude.
Yeah,
we've
ruined a few cars, and Dave Castillo had to buy one time. Yeah, we ruined so bad. So yeah,
I had to buy one.
We had fun. Like actually, Millville. I don't know now, but back in my day, they wouldn't rate it. You go to your motocrosser? Nope, we don't rent to motocrossers.
Yeah,
because we destroyed so many cars.
That happened to us at Redbud after 01 when we went there in 02,
mm-hmm.
and I went to the Avis counter and they just said no. Like, what? And they go, no. Some of these same names are coming up again, and their cars came back all mangled last year because it rained, and everyone was playing, like, bumper cars in the parking lot.
Yeah.
And I get them like, can someone come pick me up from the airport? This would be for Uber.
Bud's Creek. I made it probably 500 feet outside the drive, outside the parking, the rental car parking garage. I came around, there's a big roundy round, you know? And I think I had a Deegan in my car. He's like, hey, can you give me a ride? I'm like, yeah, whatever, okay. You know, and he got in, and we're going around and around. I'm like, oh, check this out, two-wheel push. Oh, shit. Bam, I hit the curb, blew the wheel off. Dude, I'm only 500 feet outside the rent-a-car place. So I'm like, damn, I limped this thing back in, you know? And they're like, what happened? I'm like, man, these drivers around here, they're terrible. They just pulled right out in front of me, and I had to swerve off the road and hit the curb. Like, yeah, man, these drivers are terrible around here. I'm like, yeah.
Really bad.
Really bad, yeah. I rolled one, too. I rolled a rent-a-car when we were testing for KTM in 03. Myself and Hoodie. We're testing out at Castillo Ranch.
I remember that.
Yeah, we're coming back. And I'm like, dude, check me out, dude. I'm calling McCray. Yeah, woo, we're doing this. And all of a sudden I hit this side of like this, you know, whatever the berm was on the turn and on the dirt road. And it's all poof. And it rolled, ba-bap, ba-bap, right on the wheels again. The doors are off the hinges. The back window's blowing out. You know, I'm like, oh, shit. We just rolled the car. So we roll it back in.
Did you use the drivers around here story again?
No, I used something better.
They're like,
it was a squirrel.
I pull in, they're like, what happened? I'm like, man, You wouldn't believe it. I was out here. I was looking for land, you know, because I'm trying to make a motocross track out here. And I'm looking this way, you know, driving 20 mile an hour, looking this way. And this cow ran out in front of me. And I swerved, and I went off the bank and rolled the car. And they're like, wow,
I'm lucky
really?
To be alive.
They're like, you okay? I'm like, yeah, well, I have a cut right here. But, you know, I'm lucky. Like, oh, as long as you're okay. It wasn't even in my name.
So. Oh, boy. Even better.
Yeah. So, yeah, I wasn't ever afraid of.
How about golf cars?
I was never afraid of the what if.
Motocrossers have a problem with cars.
Yeah. But I feel like I've had more incidents with guys, like charity golf tournaments.
Oh.
Like, I've seen several golf carts in the bottom of lakes.
Yeah, well, that's because the elk probably. You get some liquid courage. You get some liquid courage on that one, yeah. Mine was just straight being a kid at, you know, 30 years old.
Yeah. Do you remember Surfer Cross used to be sponsored by Toyota?
Yeah.
And 1 year at Milestone, they made a little track, and they brought a 4x4 Tundra, the off-road model. And they're like, yeah, come out. We're doing lap times in the truck, you know, so you can get a feel for what it does. So Phil Lawrence jumps in. It's this bright orange, ugly color, right? And he's just
hitting it.
Hits a turn, same thing, catches the outside edge, just totals this brand new Tundra.
He's probably the first guy in it, too,
yeah,
huh?
Yeah, well, no, he wasn't. But
and let me guess, Toyota weren't a sponsor next year.
They did not bring another truck. That never happened again. So many vehicles have been ruined.
Yeah.
All right, going back to 95.
Mm-hmm.
I was trying to suck up as much as I could from you about, like, how I didn't know, because I'm like, how do I do, how many laps do I do? What do I run, bicycle, what do I do? And you were not super helpful.
No.
You were on your own trip. Like, what were you, I mean, you kind of always had that vibe, like you were on your own. It was you and your mechanic, and you didn't take a lot of teammates in and help them.
Yeah.
Backed it.
Yeah.
Was that kind of your thing, or were you just focused on what you were doing, or what?
I just didn't think anybody could. I didn't. It was my world, you know. I would call people, hey, can you go ride? And, hey, can we wait 30 minutes? Gone.
Oh, you're
done.
Dead to me.
Done. Yeah. Done. You know, and then I didn't train with really anybody because, you know, I didn't want anybody holding me back or this or that, and I just kind of did my own thing. And, you know, I just trained so much that there wasn't really too many people that could hang with me.
Yeah.
And it was an obsession a bit. Did I overtrain? Yeah, overtrained, but we didn't know anything. I just, oh, fuck. You know, whoever trains the hardest, who's the fittest is going to win. Oh, okay.
But that's what a lot of us were told.
Yeah, well,
you put in is what you get out.
Yeah, if I train the hardest and I'm the fittest, I'll win. Oh, ain't nobody beating me.
Yeah.
You know, but that wasn't the key. You know, that wasn't the key. So, I was just kind of just stuck in my world and just, you know, I'd like to do my own thing. You know, I don't like to wait for people and I don't like to have to go off of, you know, if someone's slower than me or if they're faster than me. You know, I like to go at my pace. I like to go off how I feel, you know, and that's kind of the way I did it.
It's interesting that it took so long for there to be any kind of science in our sport that way, right?
Like,
even if you look at Wardy and Johnny Owen Bailey's days, it was the same thing. They just go till you run out of gas and then run home. They were
almost ahead of their time if you look at it. A lot of guys didn't really, you know, think that, oh, motocrossers should do other forms of training to stay in shape. I mean, those were sort of the guys that were doing all that cross training, strength training, stretching, all that kind of stuff. And I think, I know for myself, those were the kind of guys that we took information from and went, okay, well, if they're doing it, it must be working, so let's try and replicate.
But in 95, I was like, okay, what do I need to do? I'm talking to Mitch. He's like, go see Jeff Spencer.
Yeah.
He was the man.
And that's who brought that type of training and all that stuff into Wardy and Osho, and this, I believe, is Spencer.
He was, and he was all the way in Pasadena, so it was a nightmare to get there. Yeah. But I'm like, okay, I'm going to go and, you know, see what this guy says. And he sets me up with a VO2 max test, and I go do all that testing and blood work. But his program was like a basic rudimentary weightlifting program.
Nothing.
You can do squats. You can do some bench press and a little bit of this and that. And you do that. You know, here's your thing that you do at the gym like three times a week, and maybe run or it was like,
I think I got a program from him too. And I'm like,
downgrading.
I'm like, well, what's this supposed to do to me? What am I going to go get chocolate milk?
Yeah. So if you look now at how scientific it is, right? Yeah. Like you're going to do this many laps this day, then this day is this exactly. You know, it's very scripted and
there's also a lot
much more thought out now.
Yeah. Technology to go with it. You know, whether it's heart rate monitors, lit pros, telemetry on bikes, it's just so much more at people's disposal.
Yeah.
And but sometimes I almost wonder if we're almost getting to that point where people are so worried about being so precise and scientific
so
that they get their heads all messed up. Because you talk to some of these guys, they're like, well, I didn't have as much time on the bike and it rained and, yeah. and we got some testing and it's like, dude.
Yeah, relax. Motocross is a feel.
Yeah.
Well, and when we went riding with Adam Ciancirillo before he was coming on the show, it was his off day. He's like, this is my no program day. And he was, you could just tell he was uncomfortable. He's like, no, I need to do some laps, you know, like.
Yeah.
He felt uncomfortable having an off day. Or like, you know, having a day where he didn't need to do laps.
Yeah. You just get so stuck in that routine, you know what I mean? And but our sport is kind of, I think, gone a little bit the wrong way. And not so to, I mean, it has, but just there's so much emphasis on training, on fitness. Mm-hmm. But fitness doesn't create speed. Mm-hmm. Fitness creates speed for duration of time. Technique is what creates speed. Mm-hmm. It's how you ride the motorcycle, how efficient you are, how patient you are, how creative you are, whatever it is. And so that's what I've seen in this last, you know, 5-6 years is everybody really changing their technique and really changing that. Because I don't know if fitness is as big as an issue nowadays as it was maybe, you know, 5, 6, 7 years ago or even our times, because the bikes are so good now. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And actually you look at Supercross and the tracks are so easy, mm-hmm. so to speak, for how good the bikes are.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Everything's so much more rounded and this and that. Our days were like, let's see if they can jump from here to here and get over this peak.
Yeah. Oh, let's make a little square edge at the bottom.
I remember watching you guys race. I mean, in the 125 class, most guys did not jump the triple every lap.
Oh,
like
no.
It almost seemed like if you jumped the triple most laps, you were going to be a contender.
Yeah.
Like nowadays, if you miss the triple one lap, they're like, what the hell are you? You could hook a false neutral at your face and go,
rop. Yeah, in our day, we'd be at the Supercross, like, hey, Ping, grab this tape. Okay. And you got the magnifying out, and then we'd go on the other side and look, and like that. That was like, that was like the biggest worry, because you'd be shifting third right on the face.
Yeah.
You know, and sometimes you wouldn't get the third. And you just go,
die. I know.
You know, I feel Supercross should change. I mean, it's not so bad now, but they could. I think every triple should have a tabletop landing.
You know what I mean?
There's no reason. So if someone messes a mistake, boom, they can land and they can take off instead of someone making a mistake double coming up while this guy's coming down.
Yeah.
What's the difference? Now make the jump 80 feet.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Make it even bigger.
Yeah. Make the second and third one a tabletop.
Yeah, the second and third one a tabletop. Then you can make it even bigger instead of 65 feet. And if someone made a mistake, it's not a problem. You're not going to have any more risks. You're not going to have someone coming down and someone coming up.
Well, here's the other thing.
A little bit of safety thing that way.
What if fans go there to watch? Big air. They love the big jumps. I've even said 65-foot triple is nothing these days. Like you said, make it 80-foot, but make it nice, big, and safe. The crowd are going to love seeing bikes, you know, if you're in the 20th row at eye level. So
They don't care if the third one's like this.
They
or
don't. They don't even know. Yeah.
They don't know. Yeah. And so I think the equipment's so good now that I don't know if it's so much of a fitness thing, except more mentally. You know, that confidence thing of I've done my work. I ate the exact amount of imminent, you know, of almonds, and then went to bed at 10 o'clock every night, and you know, it's just that program to make yourself almost like a robot, right?
Whatever it takes to build up self confidence, right?
Where because this sport is one of the most unconfident athletes in the world, because there's so many things that can go wrong, so many things that go wrong, you can't almost be too confident because hey, your bike can break, or just like me, my hand came off, there's no room for mistakes in motocross. You make a little mistake, man. It's not you just slide on the ground and stuff like that.
Yeah. Put your helmet on. It's all up on you. I mean, even other individual sports like golf, you know, you've got your caddy there talking you through it or telling you, hey, man, I would do this, or don't let it get frustrated. With motocross, if you're getting frustrated, there's only one person that can sort that out.
Yeah.
And I agree with you. I think the mental side is something that people may overlook in our sport. It's become so scientific and all these resources, but still, I agree. I see some guys, I'm like, he's in the right frame of mind. I've seen guys, I'm like, I don't think he's going to succeed because he just doesn't look like he's in the right frame of mind.
Yeah.
And then usually that's what happens.
Yeah, I see that, you know, that it's kind of gone like equipment. You know, equipment was always everything.
Yeah,
equipment.
Exactly.
Equipment. My bike is that's why I sucked. It was my bike. Okay. Mm-hmm. Then it went to, you know, fitness. Everybody was the Carmichael Day, the fitness. Now, you know, then to me, it's change of technique. You know, everybody's changed their technique to me, what I see. And, you know, to that a certain position. And then I think the next stage is you're going to see more of the mental side. Mm. I think that's what's left out right now, because I work with so many people and then I see a lot of these top guys. It's just that they're so weak mentally, or they can't focus. They don't ever do anything. Most people, hey, you need to concentrate more or you know, harder. Okay, but how? Hey, you need to have more confidence in yourself. You have to have that more belief. You need to be more focused. Okay, but how? You need to have a technique. You can't just tell somebody to do it.
be better.
Yeah, so you got to give them a, you got to give them a technique of how to do it. And so that's where I see this next stage of our sport is coming, more of a mental side of it, because it is such a mental, you know, it's a mental bashing, so to speak, because totally if you're not confident, man, it almost could be dangerous.
Yeah.
Because then you start to ride tight. If you ride tight, then you exaggerate everything the bike's doing, right?
And the minute you ride scared, your chances of getting hurt go way up.
Yeah.
You know?
As I tell the riders of me, I go, once we create fear, I go park that bike. Yeah. If you're doing the wrong, go put it back in the garage.
Yeah.
Once you create fear in you, this is a wrong sport for you.
And like you said, you can be doing everything right. And I had this happen so many times. This is why racing is tough. You're doing everything right. You're nailing the jumps. You're focused. And some dickwad cases something and swerves into your lane, and you land on him, and you just did whatever.
Or Patrick Potato.
Patrick Potato comes out.
He's responsible for a lot of these.
or 125s. You go, yeah, boy.
Yeah. Or
your
ding, 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 ding.
Or your piston breaks in half on the face. So much stuff can go wrong.
Yeah.
That's completely out of your control. You're doing everything right, and you're still really jacked up.
Yeah.
So how do you beat that fear out and just go, nope, I got it. I'm gonna win.
Yeah, I always, you know, in motocross, you can't have a good memory. Meaning, you can't bring the past into the present.
Yeah, yeah.
Just because it's happened once or just because it happened twice doesn't mean it's gonna happen all the time. But if you're always focused on what happened, then you're always gonna prepare for what you don't want. And what you prepare, if you prepare yourself for what you don't want, guess what you get? What you don't
want. It's like looking at a rock.
Yeah,
that you're coming.
You go
up
right
on.
To it. So I see so many people, you know, preparing mentally, like, I don't want this, what might happen, so then the body follows. And the body follows and puts itself in a bad position, getting ready for what has maybe happened in the past.
A defensive position.
Yeah, they create it. They create it. Instead of always putting yourself in the position of, in the mindset of, this is what's gonna happen.
Yeah.
And if it doesn't happen correctly, at least you're in the right position. But if it doesn't happen correctly when you're in a bad position, you just exaggerated it, right?
So you hear once in a while, we had Cole Celia on, he said he was working with a mental coach last year, right before he got hurt. But you don't hear a lot about it.
Yeah.
Do you think that's the answer, or is it more, I mean, how do you work on that? That's a tough.
Well, the way I look at it is motocross isn't a thinking sport, because the mind is never now. The mind is always next, right? After this, I'm sure you're going to be hungry. You can't wait to get food, right? When you get that first bite of food, what am I going to do next?
Yeah.
You had a long day at the track. You got in the shower. Oh man, I can't wait to take a shower. Right. You take a shower. Boom, the mind's on to next. So the mind's always in front of you or behind you or around you. So most riders that are riding are focused on who's in front of me, who's behind me, hope I don't get tired, hope I don't get hurt, hope I don't get arm pump, hope I don't crash, what's my mechanic going to say, oh shit, what's my dad going to say. So the physical form's on the motorcycle, but the mental emotional form is somewhere else paying attention to that. So when that happens, you're split, right? You're split. It's just like driving your car and you go through a light and you're like, shit, was that red or was that green? You know, subconsciously, subconsciously, you know.
Apparently it was red.
Yeah, subconsciously, you know, but you can be thinking about something else because, you know, you become very conditioned at what you do all the time. So that's how I kind of explain it to people. I go, look, you're so focused on everything that you almost don't want to happen that you're making yourself split when the physical form's on the bike, but the mental, emotional form is thinking about something else. You can only hope that your wheels are going to be where they're at if you're focused on something else. And if there's any hope in you, there's tension. Tension, hesitation. Hesitation, mistakes. Mistakes, crashes. Crashes, lack of confidence. Then you create fear. Now go park your bike. But if you learn how to feel, you learn how to feel these wheels and feel. So you get like a Jeremy. You get like a Valentino. You get like a Stefan Everts. You get like a Dungy. You get like a, you know, like a Cairoli. They're all feelers. You know what I mean? And to me, when you learn to feel the bike, because you only can feel right now. I can't feel future. I can't feel past. I can't feel anything else around me, but I can feel right now. And once you feel and you can trust that those wheels are going to be where they're at, well, then when you trust, you can relax. Mm-hmm. If you relax, you have a flow. If you have flow, you have speed. If you create speed, you usually have confidence. So I always teach my guys, learn how to feel, because feeling's right now. Mm-hmm. Thinking's ahead of you or behind you or somewhere else. And that usually helps a lot of people because they've never really learned how to feel a motorcycle. And when I learned, that biggest thing I did in 2003 was learn, hey, loose arms. Every time I came in the corner, every year behind me for 35 freaking minutes. Loose arms, look ahead. Loose arms, look ahead.
Hey, it was the other way around sometimes.
Loose arms, look ahead. Loose arms, look ahead. You know, and that's, that kind of taught me how to feel things instead of always being, you know, kind of being a thinking sport, because it takes a quarter of a second to make every decision. And in motocross, that's too late.
Yeah, you know? That's too late.
Yeah.
I find that now when I, because I'm not competing, I go out and ride for enjoyment.
Mm-hmm.
I'm way better at being in the moment and focusing. And the minute I'm not, the minute I'm wandering, I just pull in. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But when I was racing, and I think maybe someone's like you said, you go out and you do motos and motos and motos. So it becomes like driving a car.
Yeah. It's monotonous.
And when you're driving a car, you're thinking of 9 million other things. You know, I remember racing and I'd be singing a song in my head or something. God, I can't get that song in my head. Then I'm having a conversation. Yeah. I can't get that song in my head.
Yeah, eating a hamburger, going through whoops. Shut up, man. I can't wait to get that burger.
So I maybe it was because I was younger and I was, you know, I don't know, being not as mature, whatever it is. But I had a hard time back then being in the moment, like you're saying.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if anybody really, if that was even in our consciousness of being in the moment now. And, you know, if you ever read that book, Stealing Fire, you know, and they're talking about the Navy SEALs, they're talking about the CEOs up in, you know, Silicon Valley and also, you know, sports guys. It's the flow state. Everybody's trying to find this flow state, which is the, you know, which is in your zone. You know, and that's where I don't even think it was really in our consciousness to think about being in the moment, you know. Mm-hmm. And but once the body becomes very conditioned at what it does all the time. You know what I mean? It becomes very efficient at what it does at all the time and conditioned at it does time. So now you've done something so much that you're almost at the third level. You're at the third level of learning, which is subconscious competency. You don't have to think about it because you know how to do it so well. Mm. But the first level of learning is conscious incompetency. I have to think about it so much because I don't know how to do it, right?
Yeah.
And so this is where you're at. And then once it becomes so easy, it's just like your mind can wander, and that's where you always have to bring it back. Hey, put yourself where these wheels are, man.
Yeah.
Put that, because there's nothing else out there except this situation. If you make this section good, then that opens up the next section. But if you make this section bad because you're tight, you're hesitant, you're making a mistake, well, then that next section that follows that is going to be you know, less than.
Yeah, you're setting yourself up for
exactly.
being in a bad place. That year, I'm going to just go back to some racing here. Was it 95? Was 95 when you broke your chain?
Yeah.
I heard a story that you borrowed that chain from Lammy.
Yeah, and again, it's, you know, we broke a chain or an engine went out in practice, and then so we changed the engine, but then they found a little kink in it at one of the chains, and they didn't have a chain, so they went to Honda, and Honda gave us a chain. Again, they didn't give us a bad chain.
No,
they gave us a new chain. But what
God, that's some damn irony, though.
Isn't it? I know, I was just thinking.
But the thing is that nobody...
There's the infamous photo.
Everybody will remember that photo, but nobody really remembers who won the championship. So nowadays, I would much rather have a legacy of something that went down in history than maybe a number one plate on my wall, you know, because now it's 20 years or whatever, you know, more than that, geez, ago. And so it's kind of irony of it is that, but then it made something historic.
Yeah.
And, you know, it you know.
That's funny how perspective changes over time too, right?
Yeah.
And what's important.
Yeah.
Then, not necessarily so much now.
Yeah, because that's inspired, you know, to me so many people than if I had a number one plate hanging on my wall in my garage that nobody even comes to.
Yeah.
You know, nobody comes to my house.
Well, that was definitely a defining moment of your whole career.
I think that photo was used in a lot of, like, inspirational quotes around racing. I remember seeing that with, you know, someone was making these signs in South Africa, you know, these dirt bike signs, and there was that picture kind of black and white, and it just said never give up, and you know, there was different slogans and that, but
and certainly
was infamous.
Yeah, and the thing is it wasn't like I go, oh, I'm gonna jump off and be famous or whatever. It just, that was
you're
me
in the moment.
I've never my whole thing is when there's a start line, well, there has to be a finish line, and we don't stop until the finish line.
Yeah.
And that was always been my MO, is that I do not know how to stop until there's a finish line. And that's kind of what I coach now, because I help Troy Casey with the Man Tribe and stuff like that, trying to get men to, you know, maybe lead a better life. And that's the thing is, look, man, you're not at the finish line yet. Why are you stopping? Why are you giving up on yourself? Why are you letting yourself get out of shape? Why are you letting yourself get depressed? Why are you letting yourself get lazy? This isn't the finish line. You know, we started, but we're just in the middle of the race, hopefully. So let's keep this life going, man. Let's keep pushing. Let's keep challenging ourselves. Let's keep trying to make ourselves better. And then, because when the finish line comes, I'll guarantee you're going to be bummed that you didn't, you know, put everything into it. And that's the same thing with racing, is, you know, making sure that you put your whole life into it, because your career is this big, but hopefully your life's this long. And that's a long time to kick yourself in the ass of, man, I wish I'd have trained harder, rode harder, worked more, or been more serious.
Yeah.
I would much rather said I did this wrong and this wrong and this wrong and this wrong than be kicking myself in the ass that what if maybe I should have.
No, true.
That's tough. You know, and I know there's a lot of racers that have that.
Yeah.
You know?
I've seen it.
Well, I mean, I don't know anybody that doesn't have some regrets, at least about things, mistakes you made, choices that were bad. I had a ration of them. You know, if I could go back and just done this different, if I would have just, you know, and most of them are injury related, like choices I made that resulted in a crash and an injury because I had so many, but what the hell are you going to do?
Yeah.
So you got picked up on the factory Cowie team. Tell me about that year. What was your highlights of that season?
The highlight, I guess, 96, you know, because 95 was such a good year. I finished second in the Supercross, second in the Nationals, second to Nations, second in the World Supercross.
Didn't you get, you rode, I want, I
rode, rode 500.
Well, no, you. But I'm saying in Supercross, you rode a 250 on maybe Indy or some other round. You got like third or something.
Yeah, I got second in 95. Yeah, I got second at Indy in 95 riding the 125 class.
Wow.
Yeah. And so, again, you know, there was things, there was brilliance in my career, but then there was just so much devastation.
Wait.
You know, and it's like I finally came to a point, like, after this injury, it's like, man, it's like I've been into an abusive relationship my whole life. It's like a wife that loves her husband so much. There's just such a love there, a deep love, but this guy beats her. But she can't leave it, you know? And it's like, I felt like almost the same way as I loved this sport and I loved riding motorcycles and teaching motocross so much, but man, did it abuse me. Mm. I mean, it has abused me like you even believe. And it's almost like I was in an abusive relationship, but the love for it, man, I can't explain.
Well, I don't know how many injuries you've got in practice.
I've had 16 surgeries, so.
So between the three of us.
Yeah, I've had.
Put some surgeons.
Yeah, I'm at 26 bones, 23 surgeries. You know, I have three rods, three plates, 26 screws, 14 ribs, lungs, livers. I've been paralyzed twice, 19 concussions. Jeez. You know, I've been beat up. And
you've paid your dues.
You're Tina Turner. Yeah. I've been putting the stank on you.
<It's a> whap!
Now, you said 95 donations, and it just came to me. Was that the year that you guys almost won and Kurt Nickel cross-rided up the hill and... I remember that. That was in Slovakia.
It was in Slovakia because Larocco or Kudrowski was supposed to ride the 500, and I was riding 125 that year, all year. And I was always good on the 500, and I raced Mammoth that year, and I won on the 500. And so it was a Kawasaki. I think the bike was already being shipped, and they're like, hey, you want to race the Nations? I said, yeah. There was no question, yeah, because that was always my it was always like my goal. Championship, the Nations, done. So I got a chance. And we went over to Slovakia, and I was just blown away by this country. You know what I mean? The spaghetti, you know, ice cream was 5 cents. Spaghetti was ketchup for tomato sauce. It was like it was like Transylvania. You know what I mean? It's like, where did I go?
We rode
this track, and it was super, super rocky. And we get done. We do our first practice, and I come back, and I remember DeCoster saying, "Oh, maybe we picked the wrong guy." You know, I was 6 seconds slower than Joel Smets. I almost cried. I've never been 6 seconds slower in my entire life of anybody.
So after you felt like you were just laying it down.
Oh, I was laying it down. And I'm like, you know, like, oh, my God. You know, I didn't know I could be that slow, you know.
And there's a lot of, you know, national pride on you.
And pressure.
Huge, especially for an American team. Mm-hmm. And so Mike Hooker comes back and goes, hey, you know what? Let's change the clutch. It sounds like it's slipping. I said, okay. We changed it, and I went back out, and I was like 4 seconds. I was like, okay, you know, I'll get this. And then practice came the next day. Then I was down to 2 seconds. I was like, all right, cool, I got this. And then the race came, and I was right behind him. And then the second race, it was when Europe was kind of against America, and so everybody kind of blocked, and Kurt was blocking me a little bit and stuff, and because Joel was in front of him, then Kurt, then me, and then Emig was kind of slowing down the train because he knew, you know? And then Kurt went sideways, and I just T-boned him off this jump.
Yeah, it was a big uphill ski jump, and Kurt got cross-rutted, and as he landed, Ryno was in the air, and just boom! I mean,
just...
Talk about wrong place, wrong time.
Yeah. And so it crashed, and I got up, and I remember clutch in, and it kickstart the 500 first kick.
Wow.
And clutch in, dude. I was like, whoa.
Jeez.
Yeah. So that was a huge, huge experience, man. That was so amazing.
But you rode well. I mean, during the race, considering, like you said, I didn't know you were that far off in the beginning, but that last race was so, that anticipation was building up, and then that moment was kind of like, it's all done now.
Because, there was only a couple laps left, and I'm like, all right.
It was just
There's two people about ready to get cleaned out.
Yeah, exactly.
If I can't get past this guy.
Yeah. And then who won it that year?
Was Belgium.
Belgium, yeah.
Yeah, it was Bervoets, Everts, and Smets. So that's a pretty good team, man.
Those 500s were gnarly to watch.
Smets was on the Hughesburg.
Yeah.
I only got to see it on TV because it was kind of, that series was done by the time I came in, 94.
Yeah.
But Even just going to Farley Castle and watching some of those older dudes. Mm. Kurt was one of them. Mm-hmm. Dr. D, Dowdy.
Yeah.
Watching them ride those, you know, badass 500s. It's gnarly.
Yeah, it's a point and shooter. Gnarly how fast. It's a point and shooter, you know?
Yeah. But it's also a handles like a damn shopping cart. I mean, that much weight and power.
Yeah.
On these slips.
And the vibration.
Oh.
Makes my arm go numb. I can't even feel my hand but after a few laps.
Yeah, it's pretty wild. Yeah. It takes a certain kind of work.
So 96, I got picked up, you know, myself, Huffman, and Emig. Yep. And we had so many stories. We'd be testing myself and Huffman, and we'd be going head-to-head, lap time to lap time, and Emig would be like 6 seconds off, you know, because night before or whatever, 6 seconds slower. And I'm like, dude, we're going to kill this guy, you know. But I just remember how good the bike was. Like, you rev it and there's no vibration. And how do you want your lever this big and throttle this and this and this? I mean, the bikes were amazing. And, so that's when you kind of finally say, all right, I've made it. Anything that you want, anything that you need, here it is, you know. And
that's
so
cool.
Factory Kawasaki was really cool to kind of step up to that world, you know.
Yeah. I rode that bike.
Oh, did you?
I think you had just left.
Uh-huh.
And your mechanic was out there. I was riding for Mitch, so I was out at the Cali track. And I said, hey, let me ride that bike real quick.
Uh-huh.
And it was the most incredible. I didn't, you know, I only did a couple little laps, but it was the most incredible engine I've ever ridden on.
So smooth, huh? No vibration.
It was completely linear and smooth, but all the power you wanted. Didn't even need the clutch. Yeah. It was incredible how fast it would pick up.
Yeah, so that year it was a good year for me. I was second in points the whole year until Charlotte, where I cased the finish line and fucking hit my chin, blew me off the back of the bike, knocked me out.
Was it the jump off the finish line?
Because it was. Emig was leading the heat race. I was right behind him. At the last second, he just goes rah and jumped it. You know, and I wasn't expecting. I just kind of brain farted and I jumped it too. But then I cased it. Bam! And it just hit me, knocked me out off the bike.
I remember that.
Spitting teeth out. And then I qualified for the race because it was a finish line.
Do we have this?
And I had a big cut. Yeah. I have a big cut on my chin. So we put a maxi pad on there. You get what I'm saying? And I was second in points and qualified for the main. So like, man, I got a race. And it wasn't a big deal except this big cut. So I'm sitting on the line and Larry Ward was sitting right there and there's blood just going bloop, bloop. And he's like looking over at me. I'm still dazed, I think, because I got knocked out.
Watch this. We got
right
it here on tape.
Right here. Guy right behind Emig. Right there. All right, right here.
Oh. Yeah. It doesn't get easier.
So it was after the finish.
Yeah, it was right at the finish. So I got up, and then they put a, you know, like did that maxi pad thing, and
it's just the way you caught your face.
Yeah,
on
just
the bar.
Knocked me out, spit my teeth out. So in the main event, I got a good start, which I really didn't want. So I got a good start, and I was fourth. I was like, damn it. And I ride, and it was kind of muddy that day. And I remember I fell over in a corner, and just that inertia made my jaw go sideways because the condyle broke. So I was like this sideways. So I finished the race. I got 11th, and I come in, and they're like, "Hey, so how's your jaw?" I'm like, I don't think it's too good anymore." So 2 days later, wired shut, and then I have a plate and 4 screws in my jaw. So that kind of stopped that year of Supercross, and I think I finished 3rd overall or whatever. But yeah, I was 2nd. It was a good year, and that was when Jeremy had his run. So.
Yeah,
you know, to finish 2nd that year was an accomplishment when somebody had such a run like that.
Yeah, yeah, incredible. That
yeah,
day.
Yeah.
And,
break.
Yeah, we're gonna take a quick break here. Want to thank 805 Beer for always sponsoring our 805 Beer Break. Troy Lee Designs for letting us be here in the saloon. We're gonna take a quick break. We'll be right back. Hey, welcome back. Future Whiskey Throttle Show. It's our 85-year break. Brought to you by Troy Lee Designs. They've got some really cool new GP gear coming out that's got some retro themes. Doesn't drop for a couple more weeks, but you are going to love this stuff when it comes out. So check it out. Their new GP retro line. Ryno.
Yes,
thanks
sir.
For being on the show, man.
I'm
glad.
I'm stoked to be here. Like I say, we've known each other for a long time, but we've never really sat down and kind of, shot the shit. And so it's cool to be on a show like this and be able to tell people, fans, you know, what's kind of going on. I'm not really into the motocross scene as much as I used to be just because of the person kind of turned into. I follow it quite well, but... so it's good to kind of tell people what's kind of happening in my life. My life is, you know, completely changed in the last few years. So, it's good.
People want to hear that too. Yeah, I mean, they want to know who you are and the good, the bad, the indifferent, whatever it may be.
Yeah, and that's where I feel that this sport has gone wrong is everybody's so secretive. So don't tell anybody. But you're losing fans. People want to be engaged with you. Yeah. You know what I mean? Be engaged with what's going on. And also, for me, you know, I don't ever hold any story back, or do I ever hold any situation in my life back, because I know when I look at my Instagram and how many people text me or direct message me about how much I've helped them, or, man, I'm going through the same thing, or, man, you really helped me figure this out. That's huge to me.
Yeah.
That's huge. You know, and that's what's happening is we need to connect more and not separate ourselves more. Yeah. You know, and that's what's happening. Everybody wants to separate themselves more instead of connecting with everybody, and then you start making a tribe, you know?
Well, you've certainly really connected with your fans, because I've seen your fan following go up and the messages. So you certainly appeal to a lot of people, and maybe it is, like you said, they see the human in Ryan Hughes, not the robotic, look at me, I can whip. You know, a lot of the youngsters, everything is... I'm going to throw a quick glitz package of me getting upside down with some cool rap music. Like, that's sort of what it's become. And I'm glad to have you on. And I think when King and I talked about the show, one of the things we said is we want to bring people up. We want people to go home and go, I feel like I know Ryan Hughes, or I understand him more. I see where he's coming from. Or I liked his point there. You know, that's the stuff we like to get as well.
Well, we're gonna get into all the personal stuff here at the end. There's quite a bit to dive into there. But we've still got some racing to cover in your career. And I want to go back. I kind of skipped over this. to what I think is the weirdest moment in Supercross history ever. Never been as weird of an incident as this. Vegas, 1994. No, 94.
Oh, yeah, with Shane Trittler and Huffman. Yeah.
So if you aren't familiar with this, you may be able to find it on YouTube. I don't even know.
No, I don't think anybody has anything of it.
There's no footage of it.
No.
I think the footage picks up with, here's what happened. There was in Sam Boyd Stadium, there was an old locker room. Is the locker room still in there?
Yeah, kind of.
And they ran the track outside the stadium and then had like this big tabletop back over the locker room. So it was 40 feet, 50 feet up in the air.
They used flatbed trucks to make the ramps.
Yeah. And I want to say you were in second, right? Huffy was leading?
I think I just passed Huffman or was right there. Yeah, one of the two. No, I was in front of him because I don't remember seeing it happen.
Okay.
Somebody told me, and I was right in front of him because I just passed him, and then he was there and the incident happened.
Okay. I thought maybe you'd gone by and seen it, but you were maybe ahead of him. Anyway, Huffman is going over this tabletop, and Shane Trittler, who happened to be buddies with Damon,
his best friend.
Shane gets cross-rutted. I don't know what the hell happens. He endos, is flying off his bike, and in midair, as Damon's going by, he lands on the back of Damon's bike.
Yeah.
You couldn't make this shit happen in Hollywood
set. Yeah.
They land the jump, roll to the bottom. I was in like fourth or something, and I come over and I see Shane hopping off of my dad's bike going, go, go, go. And I'm like, what the hell just happened? Like, in what scenario would...
You could never replay that ever again. Because after the race, I won it. And after the race, everybody's like, man, did you see that? I'm like, no. And then I heard about it. I'm like, there is no possible way. And so
I thought maybe you were in second and saw that happen.
No, I remember Shane, I thought that.
We'll have to ask Huffy.
Shane had rideshare on the back of his pants for a while.
It was a weekend sponsor. Yeah.
God, it was just a wild deal.
Lyft. Now it'd be Lyft.
Uber.
Tell me about... You had a stint where you bought a piece of property and were running a racetrack, Ryno Land.
Yeah.
What happened there? What was the intention and what?
I went. I had actually Ricky Fowler, the golfer, his dad, called me. You know, we've been friends for a while. He called me. He says, "Hey, Ryno, I dump some dirt out here and this and that. And there's Indian land out here at Anza. And I've talked to the lady and asked if we could put a track out there. And I was like, yeah, come out. And he's like, okay. So I went out there to check it out. And I'm like, oh, this would be really cool to just hold my camps and do my training. So there's a big dirt pile, a bunch of dirt piles. We made it. We got Randy Meninga in there and made this really cool track there. And then the next person comes, oh, you should do this. The next person comes, oh, you should do this. And all of a sudden it turned into like a motorcycle park, motocross park. And then I had the best tracks there was, man. The tracks were great. Amazing. Yeah. But it was a little bit out there. Yeah. And business was good at supercross track, off-road track, two motocross tracks. It was an epic, epic place. But it was a little bit out there, and so it was a little bit hard to find people, but people would always come out. We'd have some great stuff. Then Paula opened. And when Paula opened, everything shut down because everybody was just so easy right off the freeway.
Yeah.
And then I was dealing with some Indians that were just always asking for money, 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 and then just kind of found out that I wasn't really a good dirt farmer. You know, just grading dirt and listening to people's, bullshit. And I'm like, tough. Dude, like, you never grade your track. I'm like, yeah, I don't grade my track
for
because this is going to make you better, you know. But most people, they can't understand that after they've spent $10,000 on A-kit stuff and whatever. They don't understand that that's why you buy it, because the track's rough, you know. And so I dumped a bunch of money into it, and it just one thing happened to another, and just it kind of just fell away, you know. Yeah, I mean, it was a bummer because the place was so cool, but again, I didn't really care to be a dirt farmer.
It's got
to
make sense financially.
It's a lot of work. And it gets monotonous because you just have to keep doing the same things. And I know people have owned tracks. I've had my own track. But you go to someone's track and they're like, what do you think? And they'll ask you your opinion. And they go, I have people tell me it's too difficult. It's too easy. It's too rough. He's like, what do I do? I go, whatever the majority wants, if that's what's keeping your doors open, give the majority what they want.
Yeah, and this is why you don't see too many riders nowadays coming from Southern California. Back in our day, everybody came from here.
Yeah.
And even before that, everybody came here because we didn't have these practice tracks. We had to go ride Central. Mm-hmm. Have 90% of the riders ride Central now, they would quit.
Yeah.
No one would ride it. But we rode it every day, and we thought it was the greatest track, and it wouldn't rain for, 6 years or whatever. But
Pretty much.
We had the worst track on human history, but we would ride it all the time. But that type of track really creates a good rider because you learn how to relax, being out of control, the skills and this. Now the tracks are all tamed for vets and this and that.
Yeah, it is.
That you're not challenging these riders anymore in Southern California. So I feel like that drop has happened. I can't really see anybody that's come from here in a long time because the tracks are so easy that there's no challenge to it.
You know the last guy that rode at Central?
Point.
Ryan Villopoto.
Yeah.
This place, Central.
Wardy.
All right, I used to go testing there with Bones.
That was Wardy's old spot,
yeah,
right?
Wardy, yeah.
You were myself, going there with him. And then RL started taking Villopoto there, and they would go there every week.
Yeah.
And I'd try it once in a while. It was freaking miserable. Rain ruts, rocks, and like.
What, two motos, every knobby gone. Every knobby's gone, dude. It was so hot out there in the summer, even bugs didn't live out there. I remember. And I'd go out there with Wardy when I first started coming up, because Wardy was my hero, and he kind of took me under his wing a little bit. So we'd go out there, we'd do a 50-minute moto, and he's on the 500, I'm on 125, 50-minute, then we'd do in another 20-minute, and my bike would be destroyed by then because at
filter
Central.
Sucking dirt.
Oh, yeah. So my trip was Escondido, Central, Irvine, get a new bike. Escondido, Central, Irvine, pick up the bike from yesterday. Central, Irvine, Kawasaki, pick up the bike from the day before. Oh, yeah. I went through like 15 bikes that year just because that track just destroyed them,
God damn.
Yeah,
94,
95, that's where I only really rode.
Those calories were a little fragile, too.
Yeah.
What about you had some wild parties during that era?
I did some. We had some good times.
Halloween
we had some
parties.
Good times.
I remember a few. I
always just relate to the videos. I remember you I think you're on the back of Jeremy's boat, and you still had your jaw wide up, but you had a frosty in the head.
Yeah, back in our day, we had fun. Of course, it wasn't wasn't an all everyday thing or whatever. It was just every once in a while or a Halloween party or whatever. But again, you got to scratch your itches.
Yeah.
I don't give a shit what you think. If people you don't think people drink now, I've seen them all drunk.
Yeah.
I've seen them all, and it's fine. We're human beings, man. We're human beings. So yeah, we've had some great times out at the river. We'd be battling like crazy, and then all of a sudden, after that race and there was a spring break or whatever, Fro, Jeremy, myself, Phil, everybody get together. Okay, guys, this is the plan. We're going to meet out at Havasu. We're going to get a room. You get a room. I'll bring my boat. You bring your boat. And okay. Oh, my. We would kill the place, And then, of course, I had, you know, once you start making money, you get a good house and this and that. So I had some good Halloween parties, some good New Year's parties. So they'll go down in history.
Yeah.
And again, if you're going to do it, you might as well do it all the way.
Go big or go home.
Yeah. I never did anything kind of half-assed.
What's your most memorable party?
The one he doesn't remember.
That you can remember.
Oh, wow. I'd have to leave a lot of details
out of this one.
You gotta name anybody.
I gotta leave a lot of details out. Let's see, the most memorable. There was a few in Vegas. I remember myself and Jeremy, you know, having a good time in Vegas, and we were coming into the hotel. I think it was, you know, maybe 5 o'clock in the morning. We're going up the elevator, and I think we went the wrong way. We're going up the elevator, and who comes in? We're going up the elevator to go to bed. Who comes in the elevator to go catch his flight? Cliff White, the team manager of Honda. And, dude, we were twisted sister, and we're both sitting in the elevator going, oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus.
Yeah.
He's going to catch his flight. We're just going to bed. Yeah. You know what I mean?
That's so. When that awkward elevator music was so soothing. You're like, I love this song.
Yeah.
It keeps the awkward silence away.
You guys were petting the furry wall.
So I remember, I think it was 95 or whatever. I won Vegas. Jeremy won Vegas, and he rented a place. And we're all having drinks. We're partying. Yeah, we're having a good time. And I of course, you know, because if you don't, you know, you know, you drink too much. It's easy when you're not a professional or you don't do it quite well, you know?
Yeah.
Grant, you can tell us. No. So I remember, I'm like, man, oh, geez, I feel like shit. And, you know, I'm like, oh, I got to go find the toilet. So I'm laying down by the toilet, and I'm like, oh, I feel sick. I'm laying on the floor hugging the toilet. I'm like, oh. And then all of a sudden I hear this, oh. I'm like, what the hell? Am I tripping out? And all of a sudden I look up. I'm laying on this side of the toilet. Jeremy's laying on the other side of the toilet. I didn't even know he was there. We're both on both sides. And then we woke up he was halfway outside of the front door. I was halfway out of the kitchen or the sliding glass door. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. So we had some good times, but that's what it was about. I mean,
yeah.
I couldn't live life and just be without having a smile or a good story that way.
You were young, you know, you were young guys too at the time, yeah. Right? You got to have, you're going to have some fun. That was the lights out party, right?
Yeah,
where
maybe,
they had the
yeah.
sign on the door, no race talk.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good.
I showed up, but I left way early. I don't think.
You didn't have the stamina?
No, I had never drank still. Oh, yeah? I didn't drink till 97.
Yeah, I remember Jeremy, they said, like the first time he went to the river, he's like, they're like, yeah, bring some beer. He brought a six-pack.
We're like, that'll get you to the river. Yeah. You know what?
Was that just before he was there, before getting out of San Diego?
Yeah. You're like, you won't even have your boat launched and it'll be done.
Yeah.
That's funny. All right. Let's move on to Europe. So what happened, that decision, that year came? What year was that?
1998. I just kind of had a bad year, you know, some crashes, just things weren't going right. And so Kawasaki went and hired, I don't know who they hired, somebody else. And so,
98.
Yeah, 98, they hired, I think it was Emig. Who did they hire?
Larry? Larry Ward?
No, it wasn't Huffman. I don't know.
Was it Huffman?
When did Big Bird
Huffman
go
came in. Huffman came in when I came in. We came in at the same time. I don't know. Anyway,
it's going to come to us.
Anyways, unless it was Renard or something. I don't know. Maybe something like that. Anyways.
There's people at home knowing it right now. And going, it's so-and-so.
Yeah, and so I was at the last race. And then in Europe, it was Tortelli and Everts. They were battling, you know, and it came down to the last race in Greece. So Jan de Groot was like, hey, let's bring Ryno in to try to, you know, try to get in the mix. Mm. So they flew me all the way to Greece. I went to Greece, you know, did practice, this and that. Well, then Dave Grant went through the rules and found out that I wasn't signed up a month beforehand. And so they said, hey, man, the rules here, you can't race. I'm like, are you kidding me?
I came all the way
to Greece and I can't race. So I talked to a few.
And Greece was a good race too.
Yeah.
Those guys went at it.
Yeah. I talked to a few sponsors, you know, Palmo and Magic Yamaha. So from there, I flew to Italy and test rode the bikes. And then I liked Palmo and the thing that he had and this and that. So I said, you know what? I kind of want to change in my life. I want to do something different. I've always watched the GP, so why not? So I signed a contract with him. And then so I was with my ex-wife then, and my Evander was 2 years old, and my best friend Ty, that has passed away now, he said, "Hey man, this is what I'll do." Well, because I shipped a motorhome over there. Yep. He goes, "I'll drive for you," and he goes, "I'm taking massage school right now." I'm like, "Oh, perfect, man! You can help me out and drive the bus and this and that." So we went over there, and it was probably the most memorable year of my life because of going into living in Italy, trying to find your way around Europe. You know what I mean? Because again, it's not here where they're wiping your ass and making sandwiches for you. Over there, it's like, okay, we'll meet you in Luxembourg.
Yeah.
Hold on, where's Luxembourg?
Yeah, exactly. Where's Luxembourg? Yeah. Is it over? No. It's over here. Oh. So we had to figure that out. And but the people in Europe, the atmosphere, the GPs, how professional they are, even the riders. You know, the riders are so – they're professional, man. They're professional athletes. They're not – and they respect a lot of things. And so I really dug Europe. I really did. And it was a good year. I finished almost third. I think I got fourth. I had some bike issues. It wasn't the fastest bike. But – It was definitely a huge learning experience for sure. You know,
yeah,
that was awesome.
Did you find this? There was a struggle with bike setup. We always run our shit too stiff here because we're supercross focused, right? You always hear that. The GP guys come over and
I think it was
like Covington now is struggling to get used to that stiff stuff.
Yeah, I think the thing is I almost ran mine a little bit softer because back in our day, they didn't grade the tracks as much, so the tracks were weren't as rough as they are now. Mm. So they ran the suspension a little bit stiffer. My bike was just slow.
Oh,
it was just slow, you know. So that was it. It wasn't really so much an issue setup. It was just a slow bike, and you know. So I did my best, and
that was 99.
99, yeah.
Because 98 was the first year of the aluminum frame Honda.
Yeah, right? Yeah. So 99 was that, and I think 97 was maybe. Yeah,
97.
97, 98, 99. So 99, they started getting a little bit better. And I remember us putting foam, we'd eject foam into the chassis. We had weights into the handlebars. We had foam in our gas tank. Man, we did everything to try to take away that rigidity of it. But yeah, it was just a little bit of a slow bike. And but Europe was amazing. It was such a cool experience. Yeah. I planned on finishing my career there. You know, because in the next year, 2000, we got full HRC.
Yep.
Now you've made it. When you go HRC, man, it was. That bike was electric. It was amazing. But you know, the first race of the year. So that year I was, you know, had full HRC, and I'm like, okay, man, this year I'm winning this championship, and I was one of the top guys to do it.
Who was your teammate? And
Fred Bollet.
Okay.
Yeah. So he's already won the championship before the year before. Fred Bollet. So man, I trained like you couldn't train. I put 70 hours of 45-minute motos in. I bicycled 1,000 miles, ran 500 miles. I was so fit that I was too fit, you know. So the first race we go to, I think I got third qualifier or whatever that way. And actually, 99, I didn't know how to do this qualifying shit. So
the Euros are good at that.
They had 45-minute practice, 45-minute practice, 45-minute...
45-minute practices,
yeah, then,
1 45-minute
qualifier. Then 1 45-minute qualifier on Saturday. Jeez. Then they had 20-minute start practice, 45-minute practice, and then 2 45-minute motos.
Yep. Because you know, I was also there, 98, 99, and 2000.
Okay, it's at Talavera. And...
I remember this story.
Yeah,
we were at another GP.
Yeah, so I remember 99. I went there and I turned time in practice. You know, the second practice, I turned a time that under 2 minutes. Nobody's ever done that. Had the fastest time. I'm like, I got this shit. You know, I got this. And they're like, man, you know, you probably need to keep going and learn the track. I'm like, ain't nobody beating that, you know. And they're like, no. This is only second practice. There's still a qualifier. I'm like, oh, shit. So then I went out qualifier and just laid it out. Only got fourth. You know, because then you start trying too hard. So so in 2000, I was running a 20-inch front wheel and an 18-inch rear wheel on this Honda.
Okay.
And so we did a lot of testing and worked really good on the hard pack stuff. And I think I qualified third or whatever. So the first moto, you have to go into Parc Fermé, and there's a time, and you got to be there.
And it's strict.
Yeah, it's strict. And so everybody was there, and then all the mechanics started looking, and they're looking at, you know, number four is not there. So they start looking at the clock, and there's only a couple minutes, so all of them start to hurdle around the clock. And right when that, because my mechanic wasn't there, right when that clock hit that, boom, they said, shut the gate. Shut the gate. And they shut the gate, and my mechanic comes up smoking a cigarette like that, and they're like, no, you're too late. You don't race. And so after putting all that time into it, I found at the first moto that I couldn't race it. Oh, I came unglued.
I remember seeing some footage. Because we had a 125 GP that weekend. So whenever we were done with racing, we always wanted to know what happened to the 250 and the 500 Grand Prix, because there were
almost every time, the same weekends, but in different countries.
Yeah.
So it'd be a 125 GP in France, 250s in Italy, and the 500s were in like Czech Republic.
Yeah.
And then, you know, that kind of stuff. And I remember coming off and hearing about what had happened that day. I was like, what?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Then I saw the footage. So you're losing your mind.
The mechanic didn't make it. I lost my mind. I went into Giuseppe Longo, ripped open his door.
The cameraman's running off
the
run.
The door. No, you guys, rah, 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 just cussing up a storm, you know, because I was so pissed. And then after that, you know, just, I couldn't do anything. Rules are the rules. And again, in America, they would have said, things are kind of gray. In Europe, it's black and white. Done. You know? And so my team boss, he was a little stressed out. And I remember saying, hey, I go, don't worry. I go, next moto, I'm going to kill these guys.
So you couldn't race the whole weekend?
No, just that moto. Okay. Just that moto. So second moto, I got there, and then, I don't know, second, third place start, and then I got into first, and then just
checked out
by like 20 seconds, you know?
You looked like you rode, like you angry won that race.
Oh, yeah.
You looked like you just – I remember when I watched it on Eurosport, you know, later that night, I was like, that guy is pissed,
because
you blew by everyone and you rode like your life depended on it.
I was flying. I was pissed. So I dropped everybody by a big amount, and then so at the end of the race, I went DNS one for third overall.
No way.
yeah, it was so well up. I remember that.
Third overall.
At least he's got some silver lining out of that.
And then so I was on the podium, and Giuseppe and everybody come around because they're just waiting to see what I was going to say so they could say something. And I was like, yeah, you know, I guess my mechanic got lost and couldn't find this and couldn't find that. You know, I just dumbed it down really easy, you know, because after winning it, then it kind of
took you down.
It kind of took that scar away, I guess.
Yeah.
And so that was kind of the story of that. Then I went to the next race in Portugal, and I tried to jump something I shouldn't have jumped and cased it and broke my wrist. So that weekend we're trying to, you know, do everything. They're putting needles in my wrist and all this shit, and doctors shaking trying to do it. I'm like, just put it in there. Just do something. And then I couldn't do it, so then I broke my wrist that year. So I missed the whole year pretty much. And then
that's frustrating, going out to win the moto the way you did.
Yeah.
Be like, I got these suckers.
Yeah. And then that happened. So I got surgery, and I remember getting surgery in Germany. And they put an epidural in my armpit. And they had a screen here, and I'm awake. And I feel them just, you know, kind of yanking on my arm, but I can't feel shit. And they did surgery and scaphoid and this and that. And I said, okay, see you later. I'm like, whoa, that was a trip. Never had that happen. And then I had problem. My wrist kept hurting. So I went back and checked. And then the screw was in the scaphoid, but the two bottom pieces split apart. And the bone was still. So they had to go in there. One out of every three people have an extra tendon in their arm. I was one of them. So they pulled that out and wrapped it up and put it in place. Dude, this wrist is good.
It's still there? That tendon?
It's still there. It's still there, I guess. Huh. Who knows what's going to happen later. But so later that year, Donation was getting picked. And so 99, we had a GP at San Angeli. And I had the fastest qualifier in San Angeli, and I finished on the podium. And so they're picking riders, and they called me, and they say, so how's your healing going? I'm, oh, yeah, it's going great. It's going great. I go, well, you know, we're thinking about you for donations. I'm like, yeah, you guys need to pick me. I was the fastest this and this and this and this. And like, are you ready to go? I'm like, oh, yeah, I'm ready to go. Dude, I said a cast on my wrist. So they said, all right. And then I think they called like a week later, still had a cast on my wrist. And they're like, all right, you know, you're going to be on the team. Oh, shit. Uh-oh. You know, because I was, you know, you're so up for it, but then they'd pick you and you still got a cast.
Then reality sets in, you're like, oh, boy.
Yes. How much time did you have at that point?
I think it was a month. Okay. I think a month or so, and then I got going, and then I went there, and I didn't think I raced until then. But I won the first moto. I won my class. I was the only one to win the class on our donations team because Tortelli beat.
I won the 125 class.
Did you beat the 125 class?
Yeah,
so he won the 125 class over Pastrana.
Yep.
Tortelli won over Carmichael, and then I won the 500 class, but I was riding a 252 stroke in the 500 class. Yeah. Huh. And so we won the donations, and that was like, that was the most.
Career highlight?
Oh, for sure.
Yeah, you rode one of you all. Flying that weekend. Yeah. I remember that first moto. I actually got the best start out of the 125s, and I was trying to latch on to Reed.
Mm.
Chad Reed was on the 426 Yamaha.
No way.
And we were actually battled most of the whole first moto, but we just watched you disappearing. And I remember I had my teammate behind me, and he was a fill-in, Ryan Hunt. But I remember it was hot.
Yeah,
I'm surprised you didn't fade with only that much time riding. But he hit the wall at like 20 minutes.
Yeah,
and I'm like, dude, we're in a really good spot. We're like fifth and sixth right now. Like, we're good.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I get to the finish. I'm like, how did Ryan do it? Like, 28th. I'm like, what the hell happened?
Yeah, I remember because the second moto, it was like, okay, we kind of had it wrapped up. And they're like, okay, hey, you know, just, you know, ride your race and ride your race. Dude, I don't think I breathed the whole time. Because I was like, just don't mess up. Just don't mess up. Yeah, don't mess up. Yeah, I was pretty cooked after that moto because I was so nervous about, you know, making a mistake because it was almost decided, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
there's a lot of pressure. So that was really, really, really cool.
What's that feeling like, man? The guys that, you know, are on those winning teams just say, man, it's almost indescribable.
Yeah, it's indescribable. I know it's bigger now than when we were doing it, but just, you know, I always grew up looking at those magazines, watching, you know, Bailey, Osho, you know, Johnson, all those guys just obsessed. Just mesmerized by it. And so whenever I had a chance, whenever that phone call came, yes, there was never, let me think about it. No. Oh, I've raced too much or, no, bullshit. This is representing my country and the nations that only three people get picked. Dude, I'll do it. Yeah. I'll do it.
With a cast on my arm.
Yeah, do with a cast on my arm. Yeah. So that was a cool, cool experience. And then after that, I came back to, I got a ride, Factory Honda called me. And said, hey, we're developing this 450. We want you to come and develop it. So I came back over here, which was a mistake. I should have stayed in Europe and finished my career out. So because that was a plan, but I got offered such a good deal. And again, I got to go back home.
Oh, man.
You know, I had a kid.
There's always a lot of factors involved that a lot of people don't see on the surface that you got to really think deep and hard about.
Well, was Jen over there with you then?
Jen, Evander, all that. Yeah, so we had a great time. And this and that.
He was too little to be in school, though, right?
So yeah, he was 2 years old. So I ask him all these things now, and he's like, no, don't remember.
That was Italy. I don't know. I like the food.
Yeah, no, he didn't even know that. Yeah.
But, how, you know, like if you're trying to make that decision, you go, okay, probably good money to go home, right, and do that for Honda. I can be at home, factory Honda, working on this new whole thing. I mean, you know, in
That's
hindsight.
It's also enticing sometimes.
Yeah, no.
A new project, a new bike, like.
Yeah, and in your home and all this. So, yeah, I mean, it was definitely a good decision, but just it wasn't – that year was just probably the worst year that I've had.
Was that bike a struggle or what was the deal?
Yeah, the bike was like 245, 250 pounds. It was a big-ass bike. It wouldn't turn, you know, just a lot of problems, stall in the air a couple times. And so, you know, I've knocked myself out a bunch that time.
Oh, Delmont? Did it lock up in the air?
Yeah. I had one at the beginning because I – when I started riding for Factory Honda here, I did the MGM. And they're like, hey, we want you to ride this telemetry bike. I'm like, oh, cool, man. It's like a $100,000 bike. You know, the throttle, the clutch, the brake. Everything was monitored. They plug it in, you know what I mean? Figure out all this different stuff. And that year, whoever made this idea, you come out of the tunnel, fourth gear, you know, into whoops. And so
I remember that.
Right on the side was a good spot, you know. So I came out of it and I'm on the side and I clipped a hay bale with my foot peg, and dude just cartwheeled it, ragdolled myself. I don't remember a week of my life.
Oh.
Yeah, but I was in the hospital for a week and lacerated liver, concussion, this and that. So when they took the bike back, they plugged it in and they found out that the bike hit the ground at 14 Gs.
Wow. Jeez.
14 Gs the bike hit the ground, and I'd imagine I hit it pretty close to that for being knocked out for a week.
No kidding.
Yeah. Jeez. And then so got on the 450 and the year just didn't go correct, and then I had a big one at Steel City, big jump, and I hit the back brake and the bike stalled.
That was that big step down.
And just that compounded my thumb, this dislocated collarbone, broken scapula, four ribs, lung, concussion, and then had a third degree burn because the bike was laying on me when I was knocked out. And so I retired. I said, I'm done. I can't do this anymore. And I had a insurance policy from Lloyd's of London. And so I went to go collect that. And each year, as you know, in Lloyd's of London, you got to list your injuries. So I listed, you know, each year you do your best to what you can remember. Sometimes they just forget because you have so many of them sometimes. And so I went back and listed them all, and then they went back and kind of, you know, put them together, and then they got back to me and said, oh, hey, if we'd have known you'd have had this concussion a year ago, we wouldn't have insured you anymore. I'm like, what? And so, yeah, you're canceled. Because that's when 9/11 happened, and Lloyd's of London got hit, you know, by $3.8 billion or whatever. So, so they said, okay, we'll give you this year's fee back because you had to pay, you know, whatever you had to pay each year on what you're going to get. We'll give you this back, but you're not getting your insurance policy. So I was like, shit. And so that whole year I started coaching and teaching and doing all that stuff. And then I started working with Billy Ladenovich. he was riding for KTM, and then Ron Heben was like, hey, man.
Was that 02?
That was 02.
Yeah.
And they're like, hey, why don't you 02 going into 03? And they're like, hey, do you want to come test? I'm like, yeah, I'll come test. And I found out I was really fast, you know, like really fast. And they're like, well, you can race, right? I'm like, yeah. I'm like, do you want to race the Nationals? I'm like,
why not? You got my ride. Because I had a Supercross only deal.
Oh, really? Yeah.
So that's probably why.
No, but it was. But no, 02, I took the whole year off.
Oh, 02.
Yeah, but it was 03. 03, I came back, and then that's the year that we had the, you know, the epic battle of myself and Grant and Huffman and, or not Huffman, but Brownie and stuff like that. And then Stewart came back, but it wasn't really a battle.
So,
yeah, because I remember after Mount Morris, myself and Brownie just had epic battle. You know, we were so fast, and we're only like a second. You know, we're only like a second.
Well, there it is.
Yeah, what kind of start is that, bud?
Well, that was Glen Helen.
Yeah, that wasn't a very good start. But we had a epic battle, and we're only like a second off of Carmichael, you know?
Yeah.
You know, time-wise in the race. And so everybody's like, so how do you think, you know, this Bubba Stewart kid's going to come back and do it? I'm like, I don't know. I don't think he can go any faster than us. You know, I mean, Jesus, look at us, you know? So, yeah, I think it's going to be a pretty good battle. And then I broke my leg at
Southwick,
and finished that race, and then went to Buds Creek. Me and Brownie got into it on that one, and I couldn't race because my leg was so sore. And I remember sitting in my motorhome watching the race and watching this little kid crash in the first turn, and then by the halfway point, he was in first. I'm like, maybe I was wrong.
was he on a 125?
Yeah, he was on a 125. He went from dead last to first in like half a race. I was like, ooh, okay. You know?
He was next level.
Oh, he was next level. I remember at Mount Morris, or no, Millville, I went 2-2 there. And after the first moto, second moto, it came, you know, we came on, we're on the podium, and they're like, so, Ryno, how was it? I was like, it was a good race and this and that. I go, hey, when Bubba crashed, did you think he had a chance? I'm like, oh, he crashed? I didn't see him.
Yeah,
that kid could ride a motorcycle, man.
Magic, dude.
Yeah. So that was kind of funny that year.
That was a crazy year.
What was the best battle you two had?
Might have been the last race.
Yeah, we battled quite a bit at
I think it was the first and the last race. Glen Helen, we battled, and then Steel City.
Yeah.
But honestly, like that year, I'd come off a wrist injury from Supercross, and I felt like I was a little bit behind the eight ball. So Glen Helen went pretty good for me, and I think it's just a track that I've always liked. But then the next few rounds, like, he kicked my ass, Brownie kicked my ass. I mean, I even remember at Mount Morris, Sorby passed me and started pulling away, and that really chapped my ass. And I was like, I've got to do something. And I still remember I could see his fat roll jiggling when he came by, and I was like, you got to be kidding me. And you and Brownie were even way further up the road. And I remember it was frustrating.
Yeah.
And then when you had your injury, that sort of opened the door, and then it was still just crazy. I also had some bad luck. You had bad luck, and then Brownie had bad luck.
You guys must have all had DNS.
Well, Brownie, I helped at
Washougal, right?
Washougal, going up the uphill, he hit thing and he crashed.
Oh, that was that year.
And they had a flagger, and I came up, and I right when I landed, I got back, and Brownie was in the track.
Yeah.
His bike was here, he was here, and I saw there was a gap between his bike and the other and the fence post, and I'm like, I'm heading this way, and he's doing this, and all of a sudden, and I'm kind of this, and all of a sudden, he shoots this way right when I shoot for the gap. Dude, I hit him so hard, I went over the bars, I split my fender in half, and I hit him so hard, dislocated his shoulder and something else. So I got back on my bike, took off, and I think top three or whatever. But that kind of put him out for the year, you know, after me T-boned.
I didn't know that was that year. That was dirty.
Yeah, and it was
caught, and then it was just like whack.
Yeah, and then he went to run off the track right when I shot for this gap, and we just bam, we hit. just cartwheeled.
I was so sick the night before. I was in the urgent care, and I was having a miserable day. And that was the day I thought, it's done. It's three rounds off this, and I'm too far back, and I'm struggling, and I'm sick. And I came around the corner, and I see flaggers in the track waving the yellow flag, and I'm like, what would be the odds if it was Ryno and Brownie on the ground, and maybe I make up some points on this bad day? I kid you not, I came on the jump, and I just remember thinking, you got to be freaking kidding me. I'm like, you got to be kidding me. Like, I never had that experience where I just felt like someone just said, there you go, buddy.
Yeah.
It is your time. You need to run with it. Because I remember going, I was so sick and weak, and when I went by, I was like, oh, my God. oh my God, like this is happening. Wait a minute, I have a chance. Like, and all of a sudden I had this energy again, and I came back on the guys that blew by me halfway through the motor, and I just remember it was so trippy.
Yeah.
And then no one even knew, like, wait a minute, these guys are struggling, Stewart's winning, Rana had the lead, he got injured, Brownie had the lead, he got injured. Who wants to win this thing? I mean, exactly. it was pretty gnarly.
Yeah, that was probably one of the best championships, you know. And the good thing is they had it documented on the Great Outdoors, you know. So that really
was
cool.
That was a good like video that they made of it. I thought they did really well at showing the trials and tribulations that everyone went through. It was a good show.
So obviously that season ended a little oddly.
I don't think
it's ever happened before.
No, the same race got rained out twice. Yeah, it was incredible.
Last round was at Troy, Ohio, and it was a lake. You got a picture of that, Donnie? We pulled one up, but they just canceled the last round.
They canceled it in the middle of the season, and then they canceled it. Then at the last race, you know, they had it, and it got canceled, but then they called the manufacturers, and the 250 championship was already done.
It's up.
It was done. Yeah.
Look at that. Look at it. You can just see the top of that finish line jump. This is the over-under bridge. This is actually the finish. That's just a jump. But 4 feet of water?
No. probably more.
No, there was a river that ran along this, if you're looking at this photo off to the right, and it overflowed, and this entire track was in a flood basin.
Yeah.
And, you can't go racing on that.
No, jet skis. So they called, AMA called, you know, the Honda, Kawasaki, everybody. The 250 championship was already decided, and then they called KTM, and I was like, hey, you know, you guys want to, you know, we want to schedule another race. And Bubba was like 26, 27 points out, so it was very difficult for him to win, but it was up to me and him. And KTM's like, nope, done, finish, done. we'll stop the race now. They didn't care who won between us. It was just the KTM was going to championship, and they knew me and him going into the last race, it probably, you know, wouldn't have ended up too pretty. You get what I'm saying? So they're like, nope, we don't want to race. So we never really got a chance, but it was okay.
I mean, I hate to ask, but what was that phone call like?
It was pretty devastating, you know. It was pretty devastating. Like, I never got a chance.
Yeah.
And it's like, gosh, dang it. Because I whittled it down to 8 points right after Steel City. And Troy, Ohio was a great track for me. I've raced it many, many times. And then, you know, I don't think – when did you win your championship? 2006 in Supercross?
Yeah.
Yeah, so Supercross wasn't your name of the game at that point. And I was like, okay, cool. And me and Bubba kind of had a thing. He's like, hey, dude. He goes, if I'm in first and you're in second, he goes, I'll pull over for you. I kind of had this idea. Yeah, and I was like, all right, man, we got this. And then they called and said, nope, it's canceled. I'm like, I remember sitting at Jeff Stanton's house in my motorhome. And, it wasn't
when they called.
That was another beat.
Yeah, when they called him, he's like, yes!
No, when they called, we were at Brock Sellard's house, and he lives in the sticks, so there's no cell service. So they eventually had to try and get hold of me to let me know what happened, and they figured out we were at Brock, so they called Brock's house, and his wife, Trish, answered it. And then Brock gets on the they're like, hey, is Brock there? Yeah, hey, Brock, hey, we're trying to find GL, you know, blah, blah, blah. So Brock just comes down, all, hey, AMA's on the phone. They want to talk to you. You won the championship. And I was like,
all nonchalant. We were all there. Reed was there.
I still went like, really funny. And he goes, seriously, they're on the phone. And I'm like, they're on the phone? He goes, yeah. And I'm like, so I'm walking up, and everyone's like, what? Hey, really? And if anyone knows Brock, he's a jokester and a prankster. So I'm like, I even said to him, dude, that's not funny.
Yeah, yeah.
And he goes, I wouldn't joke about something like that. And I walk up, and I'm like, hello. And he goes, hey, Grant, it's Davey Coombs. You had an AMA meeting. You're on speaker. Just want to let you know the championship's concluded, and congratulations. I was like, what? And I remember, like, John Louch and a few people around. They're like, yeah. And everyone, these guys are like, woo! Yeah. And I think I just stood there like almost in disbelief. Nah, no one calls you to tell you the champ.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
You race it out, you know. And it took a few minutes to literally have it sink in. So I was like, it was weird.
It honestly sucks for both of you.
Yeah. Right?
Like, because you felt like it was,
you feel like you get
taken.
Yeah.
You know, like,
or like you said, you feel like you didn't get a chance.
I didn't get a chance. Not that it was taken. I just didn't get a chance. You know
and
what
you
mean?
You don't want to get that call. No. Like, you want to be on the freaking podium at the end of the day.
I would have rather have lost the championship at Troy, Ohio, racing than getting that phone call.
Now that's bullshit. You got paid a lot of money.
I did, but
until,
my point
until he
thing
went
is,
to the bank, he's like, yeah, screw that.
You know what? When I did go to the bank, sorry, but it did help a lot. But I would have certainly have preferred to race, because I also, even for me, it's like, I feel like people put a bit of an asterisk next to it. And so for me, it's like, it's almost like there wasn't closure either.
Yeah, yeah.
So awkward, but yeah. Well, one for the record books.
Yeah.
It's weird. Still.
Yeah, congrats.
I also have another record. I'm the only guy to tie for a championship with Hansen. In 05. East Coast. Yeah. Also, didn't ride that great that year, but
and
just
you won
enough.
More races than he did.
Yeah, so yeah, one more tough. Race.
I didn't know. I didn't know he tied. He was on a KTM that year, right? He was.
Yep.
He was good.
And I was with Mitch.
Yeah.
All right. So. And then you retired again after that.
2003. Then I 2004. I KTM again, and the four strokes came out, and just wasn't a good year. The 125 couldn't match that. Then 2005, I kind of did my own thing, and went from, you know, I was trying to ride a 250F, but you know you can't compete against those guys unless you have the best. Yeah. So then at the last four races, I rode a stock 450, and I finished fifth every race, and so that was good. And then I was just kind of like, man. I don't think I'm kind of over this motocross thing. I've done it since 94 or 84, and I still want to race, but let's do something different. So I called Mike Webb and was like, yeah, you know, I want to kind of calm down. I got two kids.
That's right.
I got two kids now and this and that. And so he offered me an amazing deal to do works races. So I went over there and did a year of that, and I won the first four races. I had like a 75-point lead, and at Washougal. In practice, they changed the track a little bit without kind of telling us, and I cased something and crashed, and I broke my humerus. I was laying, I was sitting on the side of the track, just going, "You gotta be kidding me!" You know, I just broke my arm, and I remember walking off the track, and then Hoodie came up, he's like, "Dude, what's wrong with you?" I'm like, "Man, I just broke my arm." He's like, "No, you didn't. I saw the crash. It was nothing." I'm like, "Look." And my arms did, and this moved. He's like, "Hey, hey, hey!" He almost fainted, you know. And so then. Yeah, so I broke my arm. So I didn't get to win the championship that year. And then the next year, I came back, but I was having a lot of problems with my elbow because sometimes when you break your humerus, you dislocate your elbow. And I was having a lot of problems with my elbow the next year, and I was leading the championship, and I remember being in Oregon. We had a race in Oregon somewhere. And at that time, I was getting really tired of racing. I was getting really tired of being that guy, really tired of that pressure, the expectation, and da-da-da-da. And sometimes at night, I was like, man, how could I get out of this? How could I not be here at the races? I was done.
Yeah. Mm.
And I remember I pulled off. I was middle of the race, leading the championship. In the middle of the season, I pulled off the track. And I said, I'm done. And they're like, what? You're done with the race? Your elbow hurt? And I'm like, no, I'm done. What do you mean you're done? I go, I retire. I quit. I quit. I pulled off the track, and I quit. And I was done. So I walked away.
Well, you did some GNCC racing, though.
I did some in 2003 or 2004. I did two races. Yeah, two races.
Because I did Palatka, and you raced there.
Yeah, in Florida.
And you were freaking hauling ass.
Yeah.
I was just trying to survive this race. I'd never done an off-road race. I was doing it for a story.
Yeah.
And I got stuck in a mud hole for like 20 minutes. Through the ruts. You remember how deep the ruts got?
Dude, yeah.
I've seen the video
for
this.
So I came around one time, and first lap, it was fresh. Next lap, the rut was perfect. Third lap, it was... I literally went all the way down to my handlebars. Yeah. My handlebars were sitting on the ground. I'm like, I had to, anyway.
Yeah, because I got the start. I got the whole shot. And I come into the first wood section. I went, I didn't know where to go. Yeah, I put my hands up. And I had to have someone fun. So then I followed. And then I remember going through this one section because they had a bunch of mud holes. But then they had these little stumps sticking up. And I hit one. And, dude, I hit the ground so hard, I almost knocked myself out. I'm laying in the mud hole. It's up to here. I'm all... almost choking to death.
That race is gnarly.
So I got up, and I was in third place, and then like freaking 500 feet from the finish, or not even that, some guy was in front of me, a lapper, and I hit him, and I fell over, and I got back up, and my bike wouldn't start. So that was the last time I ever did a GNCC race. You're going to tell me I ride 2 hours and 50 minutes and not even finish? My wrists are so sensitive, you know, in that much time. I couldn't even wipe my butt for like 3 days, you know what I'm saying, because you can't move them.
I didn't know what the lead pace was. I was riding a borrowed CR250 with a freestyle seat on it.
No way.
It was the only bike I could get. And so I just was like, I'm finishing. I'm just going to finish, right? And you guys came by my last lap. You guys lapped me. Uh-huh. And I was like, I'm just going to see how fast they're fucking going. You guys were flying, dude. And that was your whole pace for the whole time. Yeah. I was blown away. I had a whole new respect for GNCC.
Yeah, those
races.
Guys are badass, man.
Yeah.
Those guys are no joke.
They're just cruising on a trail ride.
No, you are wrong. I'd put any motocrosser there and they wouldn't win.
No.
No way.
Those guys are tough.
Yeah. Caleb would smoke any motocrosser there is out here right now.
Yeah.
Guaranteed.
No, it's crazy.
Yeah.
So after racing.
Yeah.
Let's get into some of your personalized stuff. You've had some rough issues kind of since then.
Yeah.
Was it kind of like what we talked about after racing? You were just struggling to figure out what now?
Yeah, I guess after racing, you kind of come to that point of who am I now? You know, and then again, you're still living with kind of an ego. And then again, I never stopped. You know, I kept training, I kept riding, I kept that. So I was probably faster at 30, you know, 38 years older than I ever was my whole career, just because I changed my whole technique and this and training, and I was so into it all the time. And then I still did fun races. I still did world champs. I did this and this. Yeah. So I was still kind of in it, but I wasn't being that guy. And so it was a very hard pill to swallow of going, hey, I was one of the best in the world, and now I'm teaching a kid on a 50 and a vet.
Yeah. Mm.
You know, it was a little bit of hard pill to swallow.
Pride and then, swallowing. Yeah.
Yeah, and then also just going away from, you know, not being that guy anymore. So that was a little bit of a tough transition. You know, the biggest thing was just trying to find out, you know, kind of a new me. Mm-hmm. You know, I was still stuck in that that persona. And then so I did that for a while. And then 2013 is when another big one, I crashed at Paula. And I remember, like, we're going through us showing the guys, you know, some this over the middle
I remember
jump
that section,
that middle jump, and then they have rollers like that. So you're hitting this section probably fourth gear wide open.
You don't want to crash it.
Yeah,
what he's
fourth
saying.
Gear wide open on a 450.
I had a moment there once, and it really changed. I went through there like such a pussy from there on out, because that was enough to scare me and go, I'm not going to try anything.
Yeah, so that was a time, that was a very, very, very big turning point in my life, because I was going through the section and I had a little bit of a swap and time stopped. And at fourth gear wide open on a 450, you don't have that. And I remember it to a T, that the time stopped and gave me a decision, chop it or gas it. And the swap wasn't so big and it's me. And I was like, you know, so right when I said, gas it, I gassed it. Right when I decided to do that, it felt like something pulled me off my bike, and I went head first into the jump. I turned this way, and I hit so hard that I went paralyzed from neck down, and I rolled down the jump just looking at my arms, and I'm just looking at them for like 5 minutes, just screaming at the top of my lung, like, oh my god, this finally happened, oh my god, it finally fucking happened. Because that's our worst fear,
right?
You know, just oh my god, I'm screaming. And then I sat there, and then all of a sudden you know, some feelings started coming back, and I'm like, okay, I broke my back, and I just laid there. And I said, hey, get my phone. I called my wife, called my mom, called everybody, hey, meet me at the hospital. I broke my back. And then they took me to the hospital. Then later that day, when I was laying in bed, you know, I was on drugs, so I kind of wasn't too coherent, so to speak. But the nurse came in and says, hey, Mr. Hughes, how are you doing? I said, I'm doing okay, but I can't feel my feet. And she's like, what? I go, yeah, I can't really feel my feet. And she started, can you feel this? I'm like, no. And then, can you feel this? And they started going harder and harder until I was almost bleeding. And then sirens came on, nurses, doctors, everything came in, and it started spreading. And it went to my chest, and I laid there until they got to the emergency room ready, because they didn't think they were going to do surgery until the next day, for like 8 hours, paralyzed. And I'm just going, oh, my God.
Wow.
And we had no idea what was going on.
So same day when you got to the hospital.
Yeah, same day. So I broke T2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Jeez.
Yeah, I broke them all. And when
you do something, you're right. You do it properly.
And it did four ribs.
Wow.
But again, just like my femur, I did four ribs, and that, I had a bump, scratch, bruise, nothing else the rest of my body. And so they got the emergency room ready. And
which I can tell you, not to interrupt, but that's very misleading. As a paramedic, when you come on, you're like, you know, you're doing an assessment of a guy. Yeah. Ah, he's got no scratches, no bruises. I mean, he's saying he's got some back pain, but
yeah. You know, I thought it was maybe just my scapula again, you know.
Yeah.
And then when I went to the hospital, I'm like, hey, is it just my scapula? And they're like, no.
But then they also deal with people that are, let's be honest, hypochondriacs. Yeah. So they're like, my back hurts. All right, buddy.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah. Well, you tend to get a little callous. So
yeah.
Yeah. So then, so they, you know, they got me ready, and that was probably one of the most scariest times in my life. And my stepdad still says when he thinks about my face, he gets queasy, you know, because of just the fear in my face. And I don't really remember it because I was all doped up. But so they put me, before they put me into surgery, they're like, you know, hey, Mr. Hughes, we gotta tell you this, that this isn't a quick fix shot. We don't, you know, we do miracles, but we don't do miracles. And so we have no idea what's going on in your body. You're probably going to end up like this the rest of your life. We have to tell you this. You know, we have to be real.
Really?
Yeah. Or you're going to have some serious problems, you know, because we don't know what's going on right now and you're paralyzed. And I'm like, oh, my God. I went into surgery not knowing that I was going to be walking again, and my whole family thought I was going to be paralyzed. And so we went into surgery, and they found out that I had hematoma that grew on my spinal cord.
Okay.
Oh, jeez.
So they scraped that off, and I guess right when they scraped it off, my feet just went, just started going crazy, you know, just like they wouldn't stop moving. So the nurses called me Happy Feet, you know. So the feet, I guess, boom, I'm like, my body's like, oh, hell no, you know. We got movement now. We're not stopping. And so the nurses come. They wake me up. Hey, Mr. Hughes, you okay? I'm like, yeah. They're like, you okay? I'm like, yes. Yes. I'm okay.
I can feel it.
I'm okay. Yeah. So I can feel my voice. So that was a good thing. And then the next day they put two rods and 11 screws in my back. And then I was out of the hospital in a week. And then I asked the doctor, I said, hey, what can I do to heal? You know, what's the fastest thing? They're like, just walk. So the week before, I was probably the fittest guy, and you knew how fit I was at that time.
Yeah.
Fittest guy around. That next week, I walked to my cul-de-sac and back, and, dude, I was on the ground. I couldn't move the rest of the day. I was so tired. Dude, I bawled my eyes out because now who am I? Now I can never be Ryno. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I could always go when I've ever had a bad time. You know what I mean? You're feeling a little depressed. You can go out and ride, and you know, you still have
do something.
You still look at me. I'm still good. I still can kick ass. Now I can't do that. And so that was a huge, you know, huge hit to me that now I can't even be Ryno anymore.
Were they telling you no more riding, or like what were they saying?
Yeah, they pretty much said no more riding and stuff like that.
You told me when I saw you at Paula a little when you still had your back brace. I said, are you done? You're like, I'm done. I'll never ride a dirt bike again.
Yeah, I remember hearing that.
Well,
because I still said, are you sure? Can I hold you to that? You're like, oh, I know this time I'm done.
Yeah, well, when you go through that, yeah. And then, so again, out of sight, out of mind. And
time
then,
heals everything, too.
Yeah, so the first month I walked 100 miles. And every day I just walk a little bit farther, a little bit farther, a little bit farther, you know. And that was kind of that story. Then I healed, got back, you know, and rode mountain bikes and things like that. Then I didn't ride a motorcycle for a year. Mm-hmm. And then I rode a little bit. And then I just ride every once in a while. But this last year kind of got a little crazy for me because I did so many schools. And I'd always ride on my schools. Because one, I can explain. One, I can dissect. One, I can, you know, whatever. But then the demonstration is, you know, because there's different ways of learning. Some people learn by listening. Some people learn by reading. Some people learn by, you know, seeing.
Yeah.
So when I can explain it, dissect it, and show it, then there's no question.
Do you feel like a lot of riders, I tend to find, I think a lot of riders are visual.
Oh, yeah.
Like when we did the Jesse Nelson ride day. Ping was doing the demonstration, and I was telling the kids, and I watch this, see that, and they're like, oh, and you could see the correlation between, it's easy to tell someone what to do, but then when they see it, they put it together almost.
Yeah.
And so I agree on that. I think that's
good coaching. I ride, anytime I'm coaching someone, I ride so that like I can show you what it's supposed to look like. Mm-hmm. And then you might not get it, but then you can watch again and be like, okay, you know, someone videos them, they can look at themselves.
Yeah, exactly. So that was a big turning point in my life is that point of not being able to be Ryno anymore. But again, it was a blessing because it kind of took that ego away. It took that persona away that I was still trying to be. You know, I'm like, dude, I'm 39 years old and I'm still trying to be this guy. And it was life kind of saying, hey, man, you know, we need to go over here. Mm-hmm. But a lot of times you're not listening. So we got to make something tragic happen almost for you to go down this other road. Yeah. And so it was probably one of the best moments in my life just by what it turned me into.
Right.
You know what I mean? The person it turned me into, because I had to look at things in a different way. I had to look at things with different eyes.
Yep.
And then, you know, it kind of almost made me look at coaching differently. You know, instead of, you know, what am I getting out of it? Well, actually, who am I helping? You know, just because I'm helping a vet and a little kid, I could actually be changing their life. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So I had a whole different outlook on my coaching, and that brought back, you know, a little bit more of a spark to it, a little bit more of an interest to it, because it didn't matter what level they are, it didn't matter how good they are. It's that I'm sharing a passion and actually maybe saving this person's life or making a career out of it. Mm-hmm. Or just being able to give this guy an opportunity to learn from somebody that maybe they look up to, you know?
Yeah.
And so that kind of changed that perspective on that side of it. And you know, so those are a couple things that, you know, changed my life quite a bit.
How were those? You don't even need to really answer this, but laying there not being able to move, like what? It is. It's the greatest fear of anyone that ever has ridden or raced a motorcycle, right?
Yeah, yeah.
It was always my biggest fear.
Yeah, it was. I mean, again, I was a little bit doped up, so it wasn't reality.
but not initially when you were on that jump. Like you said, watching your hands.
So, you know, that whole feeling of what happened was like, yeah, okay, you know, I feel that happened. Actually, I know it happened with that time stop. And 4 years later, I'm at Paula, and myself and Larry Brooks start talking. He's, hey, man, He goes, I never told you this, but I've always wanted to. He goes, that day that you crashed, he goes, I was there. He goes, I watched it. He goes, it was the ugliest crash I've ever seen in my life. He goes, you hit the jump so hard that I could feel it in my feet when you hit the ground. He goes, I walked away. He goes, I didn't even walk over to you. He goes, I walked away. I didn't want to see it. He goes, but man, the craziest thing. I go, what? And he goes, it looked like something just pulled you off your bike. I'm like, you say what? He goes, yeah, dude, it looked like something just pulled you off your bike. And that's what I felt. And so that's why I don't have any regret with it. I know it was meant to happen. Hmm. You know what I mean? I know it was meant to happen. And that's kind of like my femur. It just felt like something just took my hand off my bike. Because, again, how it laid me on the ground, not a bump, scratch, bruise, nothing on my body, but a compounded femur, it's like
the worst bone to break.
Yes, life is wanting me to take a different another direction now. But I'm the type of person, it's my strength and my weakness is I don't know how to quit. I don't know how to stop.
Yeah.
It's my strength and my weakness. And so that's kind of where I'm at now. You know, again, in my whole life, you know, all the money I've made, I've lost it. It went to, you know, house market, stock market, track, you know, just getting into a lifestyle that you just get so used to spending money. You know, I lost my house. I've been through the ringer. You know, the family members, you know, all these people here in my family has died in my career. And so I've had to start it all over and start things over. And then last year was probably one of the toughest years I've ever had of, you know, going through a divorce of just the most amazing woman that, you know, that I've met. Just you know, things just you know, we grew apart. We just grew apart, and to say bye to that, and yeah, that was a tough year to overcome. You know, come that, but I kind of soothed it a little bit by giving so much. You know, I traveled the world. I did 120,000 miles last year in the car and the plane. I hit 14 different countries, 14 different states. I think I did 33 schools from May till December.
Dude, you know, following you on social media, it was like a TV series. Like, yeah. Where's Ryno now? You know? I mean, you were in Iceland, in my home country, yeah. South Africa. I mean, you went everywhere, and everywhere you went, you had a big gathering. And you seemed to just make those things on the fly happen as well.
Yeah.
Am I right?
Yeah.
That's
what
it seemed like. You just said, you know what? You guys want me to go? Get me a ticket, and I'm heading that way.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, we'd see your plane ticket, and there's Ryno heading to another country.
Well, that's what I wondered is, like, how are you doing it? How are you paying for that? Are the people that are bringing you in for schools, they're buying your tickets and putting you up? And like, how are you buying food? How are you buying clothes?
Yeah, so what the thing is, yeah, when I go there, of course, you know, this is the fee, or this is what I need to make. This is the fee. You bring me here. This is what it is. Now, did it work out like it was supposed to? No, of course not, because it's motocross. So, you know, it wasn't as much, you know, but I made really good money, this and that. They would house me, you know, they'd pay for the food, this and that. And again, my lifestyle isn't crazy. I don't have any hobbies or buy anything.
You have a new hat. I did see.
I do my hat. I got my hat. Man. I like my hat. Yeah, I like my hat.
It's also good to keep the sunburn off the neck.
No. That's kind of a good pick-upper too. You know.
Yeah.
We had some fun this year. I kind of got a story from about every country.
Yeah.
But that's a different show.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was good, and I would just kind of go on the fly. I had some stuff lined up, but then, you know, I just kind of go on the fly and say, "Screw it, man. Let's there it is right there. Ooh yeah,
there it is.
Yew."
Hat and glasses.
Yeah, baby, got the Armani's going. But yeah, that it was just, you know, I was kind of running a little bit away from a situation that was, you know, so heartbreaking. But then I was chasing what was being asked for, you know, more coaching, more, because when I go to South Africa and I go to New Zealand, nobody has any coaching. Nobody has the level that I'm bringing. Nobody has this technique that I've developed. You know, I mean, how everybody's riding around from Ken Roczen to all these guys. This is what I've started teaching 10 years ago. You know, 2010, I started teaching balls your feet, hips out, chest up, this and that. Now you look at every single rider, and they're riding that way because you can't deny where the body's at its best. And so that's where
the
I go around.
The feet thing is something that's really you've seen evolved in all the younger riders. And looking back, I think that was something that I was really bad at. Mm-hmm. I was very flat-footed, and I think that hurt me in a lot of areas.
Yeah, but the hips, rotating the hips out is one of the best things that you can ever do. I mean, I even watch you. And your style has changed.
Yeah.
You know, it really has. And you can't, again, you can't deny where this body's at its best.
Yeah.
You can't deny it.
I think all of us still, I mean, I'm a student. I've been watching, I watch guys and I think, God, that looks cool. I've seen Ken Roczen.
Completely,
you know,
changed.
In a lot of turns, never puts his foot up. Mm-hmm. Just feet on the peg, sits down and gets through it. If it's a long rut or whatever, he'll put his foot out. But I started doing that. A lot of it is because I have crappy knees and I don't like to put my foot up. But when you can sit down and not have to have this extra motion of foot out and you just pop through a turn, it's like,
well, too, if you compress into the bike a little bit,
it doesn't upset the chassis as much, you know.
Is once you take your foot off, you've unbalanced the bike, so to speak. So foot on, gripping with your ankles is what it is. I mean, we could have a whole podcast on technique. So, you know, this year was a tough year. I knew my family was going to be moving out, but I was on a tour, you know, in the States doing schools. And when I came back, I remember, you know, opening the door and my house echoed. I'm like, whoa. Everything was gone because they moved out while I was gone. And, you know, I knew it, but when reality hits.
It's like
And then I walked around the hall. I walked through the hallway, and I went by my daughter's room, and her room was completely empty. Dude, I hit the ground on my knees just crying because I'm like, oh, my God. I don't think I'm ever going to live with my baby again. You know what I mean? I mean, it was devastating. So that was a tough transition to get through. Then I went overseas for 9 weeks, and I sold my house while I was gone because whatever. And I come back, and, you know, I'm at my mother's house. I'm 45 years old. I'm sitting in her room. All my stuff, because everybody had to move my house. Five people have my house. I don't have a house. I'm just like, I mean, that was one of the scariest days of my life. But because of, it was scary.
Reality check.
There's a reality check of what happened. I knew this was happening, but until you face it, you know, it's tough. It's almost like an injury. You know, a lot of people want to race motorcycle and go crazy. Then they have that first big injury. Mm-hmm. They're not the same, you know, until the reality hit. And so that was a thing. And now, you know, now I can say I'm probably at the most peace I've ever been in my life. You know, I'm very content. It's like life has humbled me so much that I don't really want to, I don't need to chase it. I don't need to challenge it anymore. It's just like, all right, here, you know, kind of like here I am. And so I live down by the beach right now, kind of living with a girlfriend a little bit, and just allowing life to see what this next direction is. You know what I mean? Is it still coaching motocross? Is it still doing this, or is it kind of doing more, you know, helping you know, the majority of people,
the average,
I don't like to say the normal, just like
the average person,
the everyday person.
Not the guy that's trying to be the next world or national champion.
Yeah,
the guy that just wants to ride, have fun, and be safe.
Yeah, even that, not even motocross. Just a guy that wants to clean up his health, wants to get his lifestyle on point, is a little bit lost, you know, his or just had a divorce, or now he's older and his kids have moved out, and it's, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
There's a lot of guys out there struggling a little bit. And so I've met, like I say, this guy, Troy Casey, that does Certified Health Nut. He does Man Tribe, and just, you know, this whole breathing, you know, the Wim Hof stuff, and then the cold fusion, man, there's some magic in that, you know, there's some magic in that. So that's kind of got me a little bit interested. But, you know, coaching, I have this ability to coach, and it's very hard for me to get away from that because it's such a, it's a gift.
Yeah. Well, if you're good at it, stick with it.
Yeah, it's a gift. But now I'm at the point, I was like, man, I don't know if I can ride. I can't do this anymore.
Yeah.
I cannot do this to my body anymore. And I cannot do this to my mom anymore.
Yeah.
You know, and my body, it just, I mean, dude, you know, I've 26 bones, you know? I mean, it's insane. So so that's kind of where I'm at right now.
And so you're still trying to kind of figure out what the next direction is.
Yeah, what the next direction is, just because, you know, I don't really have the best feeling with motocross right now, just because it's such a harsh sport. Mm. You know, it's such a harsh, brutal sport. And it feels like I almost need to kind of step away from that to almost like close that curtain of my past life.
Dude, let's go dual sport riding.
Yeah, well, there you go.
That
is
fun.
Well, that's what I planned. That's what I wanted. Yeah, that's what I planned on wanted to do.
We're not gonna pin it like it's a works race. But when we trail riding is one of those things. I think it's still gives you a little of that feeling of being free and enjoying it, but it's more casual and camaraderie. And you stop and at lunch, you know. Maybe you grab a beer and you have a burger. You talk about Ryno falling down that little ravine and how we had to help him out. Whatever.
Yeah.
And it's cool. And then after you're done, everyone's sitting there BSing and you talk about your next ride. But I think that's something that could be something for people that want that little bit of edge.
I would definitely do that. I definitely would put that in my life because I don't think I ever can stop riding a motorcycle. Just the motocross, I just have to, you know, I have to be intelligent about it. And because, can I ride again? Of course I can ride again. It's only a femur. But you know, the consequences of it is what's, you know, come to the point. So, you know, so that's where, you know, I'm at. You know, a lot of people think that, you know, they look at social media, they follow you, think you have the best life and this and that. But, man, we're all stuck with some battles. We're all stuck with some tests and,
Well, you're more open about it. A lot of people portray everything's perfect. No. And then you find out one day, like, they went off the rails or something, and you find out behind the scenes there was a lot more to it.
Yeah, well, look, it's kind of like healing for you, you know, when you can speak and you can be honest for it, it's healing. But how many people are going to listen to this show and maybe 10 of them, 5 of them go, man, you know what? I've gone through the same thing. Or, oh, shit, man, I was so bummed and I see, you know, Ryno, he went this way and did this way. It kind of gives them a little bit of hope. And that's what I feel is if you don't share, you don't help the next, you know. And the only thing you're doing by keeping inside is almost, you know, building that up. You have to accept.
Yeah.
If you accept, well, then you can allow. And if you can allow, then you can progress. But if you don't accept, then you can't allow, and then you stay stuck. Mm. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, you know, accepting what's happening and that to allow the change or to allow the lesson, you know, because I feel life, God, whatever you want to say, it doesn't have a voice. The voice is situations, right?
Yeah.
And those situations are what speak to you. Now, we're the only creature on earth that has, you know, that has the ability to have free will, to decide. And so this situation comes in, it's life speaking to you, God speaking to you. Here's your situation. You can take it and progress, or you can take it and stand still or go backwards.
Oh, for sure.
It's your free will.
You know, as a Christian guy, like my thing is always, if you ask for more money, God isn't going to deliver a check. He's going to give you an opportunity to go work for it.
Yeah, you're going to meet it halfway, bud.
I need patience. God, give me patience. He's going to try you. Right, and help you develop patience.
Oh, he's tried me.
So I mean, that's
still working on patience.
But that goes hand in hand with what you're saying, right? I mean, you're not going to get what you want right away or directly.
Yeah,
you're going to get opportunities to get it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you got to meet it halfway. You know, and too many people are just sit back and say, this or that.
Yeah.
And it's like, no, man, you got to meet it halfway.
Yeah.
You know, you got to put it out there, but then you also have to put the work behind it. And that's, you know, my biggest thing is that I always look at these things that happen and go, okay, why? Mm-hmm. Not that I have to figure it out, but there's just something in there. So the femur, there's something in it. And when I, you know, this is more the feminine side, you know, so I tore a bicep tendon this year. The left side is the more feminine side. It's softening me up. You know, the people that I hang out with now are just like, man, you're so lovable. You're so calm. You're so steady. And I go, man, you need to talk to people that.
You're talking about the same guy.
Yeah. You need to go talk to people that knew me like five, ten years ago. It'd be a completely different thing, you know. And but I'm just.
But that's cool. That's growth.
Yeah, I'm so happy at who I am right now. Yeah. You know, yeah, I'm not as successful as I was. I'm not maybe as popular as I was. I'm not as the athlete that I was, this and that. But just I can wake up every day at peace.
Yeah, but how do you define success?
Well, yeah.
Right?
Yeah, success. See, there's been many people that have been rich, many people have been powerful, but how many people have mastered themselves? So for me, I've been rich, I've had money, fame, but the only thing that's ever been missing me is mastering myself. So that's kind of my new path, you know? And I'm very big into yoga. So that was kind of my new path that I wanted to start really going to. I was going to go down to Costa Rica and stuff and stay down there for a month and do, you know, yoga stuff and get certified. But then now I can't even stand on one leg. So I kind of threw that out the window. Yeah. So I got to be a little bit more patient. And so, you know, that's kind of where, you know, life fits in, I guess, right now. And, I think this year, too, was the first time that I was able to take the pressure off myself of having to be somebody, having to live up to the expectations I built in my own head of what I thought I should be, what the expectations that everybody else thought of me that I tried to live up to.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Trying to be that guy that everybody saw in the rearview mirror. You know, so this is the first year that I don't, you know, people, hey, let's go race this or let's go mountain bike or this. I'm like, dude, I don't care to compete against anybody. I don't care to be better than anybody. I don't care to challenge anybody. I'm good.
Yeah.
I'm done. And it was like a huge relief because I finally accepted myself this year.
Yeah.
And because I wasn't accepting myself, so I always had to prove to myself or show how great I was. You know, I had to pad this ego or pad this persona that I built up. And
was behind that? Where you always were, because you were always driven and like.
My mom said I came out angry. She's like, Ryan, she's like, you came out angry. He goes, I've asked my mom and dad, I said, why weren't you guys harder on me when I raced? They're like,
what?
We probably didn't need
to. We just stood back. We just stood back and just said, go. We supported you and just stood back.
Yeah.
He goes, you didn't need any more motivation. You need any more drive. You need more.
It was just you, huh?
Yeah, it's just me.
Yeah.
You know, it's
different
just me.
Things make different people tick. You know, that's my conclusion with a lot of these things is something made you tick, and it was a different way to get there. Same for me, same for you. How involved are you with Ryno Power?
100%, man. You know, we're jamming with that, myself and my partner. We own 100% of the company. You know, we've never borrowed a penny from the bank. We've never had an investor. We've done this all on sales. We built this company off 10 grand. We started with 10 grand.
That's tough.
Yeah. 10 grand we started with. Yeah, we had somebody to help us, you know, a little bit. Just would give us products that we ordered, and then we'd pay them back once we sold it. So that helped out a lot. But we've only built this on sales, and I'm kind of the face of it, you know, this, hey, let's make it this, you know, products, test the products and this, that. But my partner, Ryan, you know, he's the one that's built it. You know, he's the one that's built it. So we own 100% of it. We just came out with a new bar. We're probably in 15 different countries around the world. You know, we've done it organically where we're slowly building. But again, we're a company with no debt. We have zero debt, and so it's pretty cool. We have a great name. Our product is, you know, I feel is the best out there, not just because I created it or it's my company, but just I've tried many different products, and the taste, the performance of it, and, you know, the feedback we get, you know, I couldn't be happier.
Yeah.
And we're jamming. We got a bar just came out. We have a gel coming out. And so, again, we only spend what we make. You know, and so
that's
it's pretty
tough
because
to get into stores, you get slotting fees. I mean, you just like you got to pay to be into these places, and damn it, it's hard to grow without either having your own a crap ton of your own cash or having someone bring in some money.
Yeah, and so you know, he's done an amazing job. I give it up to Ryan, you know, all the time, and we have our differences because I'm so freaking out and left view, you know, what I say and what I do, he doesn't dig sometimes, but you know, I can't
sometimes
deny.
Makes a good partnership though,
but I can't deny being me, you know what I mean?
Right.
Yeah.
If someone's here and someone's here and you guys are able to meet in the middle, that usually makes a great partnership.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's going good. And we just launched back into Europe and website in this. And we have probably a top almost top eight guys in Europe right now. And so it's jamming. We're really excited for the future. But we're just, again, just chipping away. And there's a lot of competition out there. So, you know, that industry
market
is saturated.
Yeah.
But it's more saturated in America than it is in Europe.
Is it?
Oh yeah, and so, you know, again, we want to do it organically. Do I care to be super rich? No, it's just a baby, you know, and it's fun to watch it mature.
Yeah,
you know, down the road, yeah, we'll sell it, but you know, I'm not a greedy person. I don't need much money.
I'm a bar guy. Like I'm
a bar guy too. I want to go to the bar to have a drink.
Yeah,
we have something in common.
Yeah, it's a different bar.
Bar. Okay.
Okay. So what we'll do before I leave, give me your address and I'll send you a couple boxes of our new bar.
Rad.
We'll love it.
Yeah,
dude.
The Mana
love
bar.
It. Yeah, you'll love it.
So
very
I just
good.
Am always on the go, or like if I'm out riding, I'll just kind of forget to eat sometimes, and then I'm freaking starving, you know.
Yeah.
So it's something I can keep in a backpack or whatever, and they just hold. I end up eating a shit ton of them.
Yeah.
And what I hate is that we'll buy whatever's at Costco in bulk, and whether it's Cliff or whatever.
Yeah, then you buy and you're like,
They're not great.
Yeah.
There's a lot of crappy products.
Yeah, there's a lot of crappy products out there. And, you know, I mean, everybody tries it. But I think everybody goes for the money first before the taste or the performance. So we always go for taste, performance, and then money.
Yeah.
And because I take my own product, and again, the quality of it is what sells it.
Yeah.
Not, you know, how much you're going to save. If you don't sell anything, it doesn't matter how much you're saving.
Yeah.
So,
right.
You know, so I've built, you know, I've got four different things out there. You know, Ryno Power is the supplements. Of course, that's the biggest thing out there of me. Then I have a website, Ryno Power Gym. And now nobody's ever had that in the sport. So I have like 100 different movements in the gym, videoed and explained. I have technique, 25 different technique tips, yoga, stretching, workouts, you know, 4-month planners. I have nutrition recipes, all that stuff on there for people to educate themselves, and because there's a lot of places that don't have coaches.
And that's rhinopowergym.com?
Rhinopowergym.com. And then all my schooling and all that stuff, we're revamping that, you know, because I'm a certified health coach, so I can, or a life coach, so I'm going to start going that. I made a certification with my technique where I can certify people, you know, to teach them how to teach the fundamentals, because there's never been any fundamentals in motocross. Mm. And so I feel that I've created the fundamentals of where to control the motorcycle, where to be one with the motorcycle, how to balance and stabilize the motorcycle, how to flow with it, how to be ahead of it. Those five things are the most important things you can do on a motorcycle. Once you create that, then sky's the limit. But you should never go past mastering the fundamentals, just like in any sport.
Right.
Peyton Manning, or let's say, you know, Drew Brees. Well, he's not going away from the fundamentals. He's the fundamentals are fundamentals of fundamentals. And so I've created that a bit. So that's, you know, Ryno Institute. And then I created some foot pegs because I was always going to the gym and using Busu balls and all this stuff that's full foot, you know, if you're full foot.
Yeah.
But then I'm looking at my motorcycle and looking at my mountain bike, and I'm like, well, wait a minute. We only use 2.5 inches of our foot. So why aren't we balancing on the balls of our feet? And this is what I teach. So how do I get people to be stronger, more stable, more coordinated, more efficient through their feet? Because your feet are so important, right? When your feet become underdeveloped by wearing shoes all the time, because they're like casts, when your feet become underdeveloped, then your core becomes underdeveloped. And you have 100 different ligaments, you know, muscles, tendon, ligaments, joints, bones, and your foot. The thing is so complex. Like Da Vinci says, your foot is the most complex suspension system ever created, and mechanics will never recreate it. Mm. Mechanics will never recreate it. So that's saying is that people put their feet in boots, and just like you got on a motorcycle and went, huh.
Yeah.
But now the first point of contact from bike to body or from body to bike is being what the track is given to the bike and the bike's given to you is met with stiffness.
Yeah.
That's like taking suspension off the motorcycle. That's why you can be on the balls of your feet now with the tracks given to the bike and the bike's given to you is met with softness, just like the bike does.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And so that's why I created these foot pegs to try to
Is it like pegs mounted to a ball?
It's just mounted to a you might be able to bring it up. I don't know. It's mounted to a rubber spring.
Okay. Yeah.
It's the most safest balanced device in gym, but all in all of gym history, nobody's ever created anything to ask you to balance on the balls of your feet.
Yeah.
But every sport and every activity on earth comes from the balls of your feet.
Yeah.
That's where everything starts from. But
you get them on there and do like med ball movements.
Yeah, the biggest thing is just getting in the balance on it. Mm. You'd be amazed that they, you know, I get some really fit, you know, really top athletes
and they're just
yeah. You know, but once you do it a while, then you get it. Like my son, he can do squats on it holding 100-pound dumbbells, and that's fucking gnarly.
Yeah,
and so it's a very difficult thing to do, but it's very safe because it's only, you know, 5 inches off the ground.
Right,
and so it engages every muscle in the body, you know, yeah, in your core, from your core to your legs. It helps your joints also too. So very good for rehab. Then you can put your handlebars there and do some push-ups with it.
That's what I thought I saw.
Yeah.
Didn't they have that at the Supercross?
Yeah, they have it at Supercross.
VR and all that?
Yeah, they have our spring bike thing that we created, because I created that to try to help people learn technique. Because it's sometimes very difficult. Let's say someone's wearing a neck brace their whole life, and their knees are in front of their shoulders, their upper body's in the back of the bike, and I'm saying, hey, this is the most dangerous position you can ever be on. We need to change that and get you to come forward. Mm-hmm. Now, you get someone from back here to come all the way forward over the motorcycle like you're supposed to be, like we ride, but now you put jumps, bumps, ruts, you know, uphills and downhills in front of them, you're going to be limited because now there's a consequence.
Yeah.
So if I can get these guys to learn how to feel where their body is in a safe environment, well, hopefully that'll come out onto the bike. You know, somebody rehabbing an injury, da-da-da-da-da-da. So this was kind of the idea behind it. And this is, yeah, these are the foot pegs here, you know, right there.
Cool.
So they're that, just a spring, and you put the handlebars on top of it. But, you know.
So the handlebars mount on the.
Yeah, the handlebars mount on top of that.
You can see the bone mount.
So you can use it as bars or as pegs.
Yeah, so if you look at it, you go, okay, well, I don't need to be in the balls of my feet. Well, then why is Tomac? Why is Roxon? Why is Cairoli? You know, every single person is riding on the balls of their feet now and gripping with their feet as tight as they possibly can, and that's made this next level of speed, right? And rotating the hips out and this and that, and you cannot do a squat on that unless you do it absolutely perfect, because there's 100%, there's 360-degree movement at 100% of the time because of that rubber spring.
Mm.
But you can't fall off it. That's what's cool about it,
you
know? So, so these four things I've kind of created and brought it into it, but a few of them has kind of been a little bit like a stepchild to me because I've been so busy trying to bring this technique, this thing that I've taught, you know, brought it into motocross. You know, just beating it and beating it and beating it. And I, you know, I get a lot of shit from hips out and hips out. Well, fuck. Look at everybody. Look at Roxen. Look at Tomac. Look at all, everybody's rotating the hips out because you have to have separation in the body.
Yeah.
If you have separation in the motorcycle, you can't have something opposite on top.
Do you look back at old photos of yourself?
Oh, like, God.
Because you were this. You were like Johnny O, you know, kind of
hunched over. Oh, yeah, dude, I was hunched over. And it's like, man, if I would have just had this technique back then, the record books would have been different. It really would, because it opens up so much more speed and opens up so much more efficiency, right? Mm. And because you're allowing the body to work correctly from your hips to your feet or for the rear end of the motorcycle, from your hips to your head or for the front end of the motorcycle. You have to have separation. Yeah. Because the bike is one, but it's two. It has a front end and a rear end, and they always work opposite. So the bike, the body has to do the same. It can't be like this, and then the whole body moves. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And then once you're hunched this way, tucking your butt, and that bike is going forward, but you're always in a constant pull. Tight arms, exaggerate everything. You round your shoulders every time you're braking, well, now you're in a constant push. Tight arms, you exaggerate everything. Every time your arms are tight, you exaggerate anything the motorcycle's doing. Mm. Right? So it's putting the body in a position where it can work functionally and can work the way it's been designed millions of years ago.
Yeah.
And that's kind of what I've been getting at.
You've always been against neck braces from the get-go. Yeah. I tried to be open when they first came out. I'm like, hey, whatever we can do to help people, right? Let's give it a try. And so I was riding with them. I tried every brand you could get, and I had a couple of moments where I got kicked and I had to get off the back of the bike, you know, brace pushed my head forward.
Yeah,
and I almost got shot over the bars a couple times, and I said, that's it.
Well, the thing is you can't put something on the body at the highest point and then limit it. You know what I mean? You're limiting what this movement can do. You're locking yourself up at the highest point. That's impossible. This has to have movement up here. It's just like top of a tree. A tree is strong at the bottom, very loose up high to withstand whatever direction that wind is coming from. So the same thing is you have to be able to move and groove up here. You can't be stiff because now you're going to exaggerate everything that this body's doing. So whenever you go over the bars, you can't tuck your head to your true potential, so you're almost a lawn dart. When you go over the bars and you're trying to get back, it pushes your head down, down, down. Your head can hinge off it, you know what I mean? And so, yeah, there's some braces. Yes, I believe that it's very important to make the sport safer, but I feel that we've gotten so much into bracing that we went away from strengthening. Mm. You know what I mean?
Well, even flexibility.
Even knee braces. Knee braces. Why do we wear them? You know, it takes so much. It limits the body so much because you have 30 to 40% of interior and exterior rotation of the knees. Take 30 to 40% of anything that's supposed to move in your bike, take that out, and how good are you going to ride your bike? The knees have movement in it. So once you lock those things up, well, now you're only moving from your ankles to your hips. Or if you ride flat-footed, now you're only moving at your hips. Now if you tuck your butt, now you're only moving at your arms, and you're always counterbalancing the bike. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, and then again, what you don't use, you lose. So now your knee maybe doesn't have to work to its true potential to stabilize itself because it's like, I'm in a brace. And so I haven't worn knee braces in 2 years, and I feel so good on my bike. And I'm not saying go away from them, but it's plain and simple. What sport wears knee braces? None. You know, Brigham Young University did a study on it. They had 50 football players that wore them, 50 that didn't. After a two-year study, the 50 football players that wore them, there wasn't any evidence that it saved their knees. But the 50 that wore them, their playing decreased. Because they didn't have the mobility, they didn't have the efficiency, you know. Because you have that, you're locking it up. You're limiting the body. I'm sorry. There's no way against it. And so
there's definitely truth to that.
Yeah.
My theory that I was told when I was younger, when I had my first knee injury, was rather injure something else, it'll heal quicker than blow your knee out.
Yeah.
That was the theory on wearing braces. My thing I feel like now is if I went to the track and I left my knee braces at home, I don't think I could ride because I'd feel so awkward. So now you're in that position where I'm like, I got injuries and this is like my comfort food. But as far as the neck brace goes, I think that's still a very controversial subject in our sport because there are people that are adamant on it and people that are adamant against it.
Yeah.
My experience was I had a chance to see some testing results. I tried to wear the brace. I didn't like it. I didn't feel right on me. Every time I have a tendency to be like this, it hit me in the back of the head, drove me nuts. Imagine riding and it feels like someone's bopping you on the head. It made me angry. And then when I saw some of the results, I'm like, wait a minute. This could actually potentially be more harmful than good.
Yeah.
And I just said, I'm out.
Yeah.
And I've had some people yell at me and tell me I don't know what I'm talking about. I'm like, I saw some proof that proves that what I'm saying, there is truth to that.
So I don't push it loud. I just say, hey, everyone's got to make their own decision.
Yeah, yeah.
For me, it's no good.
So I always tell everybody, go off feel, because your feeling can't lie. Your mind can lie, because your mind will lie out of conditioning, what it's been told, and out of fear.
Yeah.
You know, but a feeling cannot lie. If you have a stomach ache, dude, you have a stomach ache. You can't say I don't. You know, but if you're not going to the gym, well, now your mind can come in and say you're a pussy, you're lazy, you're this and this and this. But so I always tell everybody, hey, go off your feeling. If your feeling feels better on the motorcycle, well, don't deny it, because your feeling can't lie. And again, you know that where it's pushed into your back. You know, there's so many little things, and I don't want to just sit here and dog on these things. So I'm kind of over that, but. You know, I don't feel that you need to immobilize joints. I feel that you need to strengthen them and then also make yourself pliable. You know, because when you do hit the ground, you can bend, not break.
Yeah.
So everybody's training, riding motorcycles, and they're getting in this fixed, hunched, you know, position. But then when they crash, they have no pliability to them. So that's why I'm so big on yoga.
Yeah.
I feel every motocrosser needs to do yoga to one. You know, I tell everybody, look, I'm going to train and I'll do everything I can to try to make you win and try to make you fast as you want to be. Okay. And so hopefully we can do everything we can to make you win. But I will guarantee, I'll put all the money that I have on that you're going to crash again.
Oh yeah.
This is part of the sport. So we have to train to win. Go fast, but we also have to train to crash. And we don't train to crash by just riding bicycles and shit like that. That doesn't do nothing for you crashing. Mm-hmm. We have to get in the gym, make you strong, make you stable, but then also we have to get into yoga, make you pliable, and make you strong when your arm is back here, mm-hmm. or make your spine flexible, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And make you balanced and just have a little bit more of a kind of a know-how of where you're at in the realm of thing. And then also mentally. What yoga does mentally, it keeps you in that present moment. It teaches you how to stay in your own lane. This yoga mat is your own lane. Don't get out of it. Don't compare. Don't compete. Don't anything. So when you're riding a motorcycle, it's the same thing. Don't compare. Don't compete. Mm. Don't judge. Stay in your lane. Stay, you know, that, because that's the only thing that matters is the track, the bike, and you.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So all these things, how you do anything is how you do everything. And so you can take these little things and bring them into different parts of your life. And so that's kind of... You know, how I'm thinking, I just see so many people wearing, you know, braces and wrist braces and stuff like that after they broke their wrist 3 years ago. I'm like, dude, now your wrist, how weak is your wrist? Because what you don't use, you lose.
Just true.
Yeah.
You have to be able to, you know, strengthen yourself to get back.
Like I said, they break their wrist, they put it on, and then they're like, well, I'm just going to keep it on because
a lot of it's psychological.
People have told you it'll help you.
Yeah, and I feel that, you know, I can see people's wrists, they go down like this, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then also... I didn't wear. I've been wearing for 2 years knee braces, and then I went to Argentina and I left my gear in New Zealand. And the guys was there. Hey, let's go trail riding. I'm like, okay, but I don't have any knee pads, and my shit, man, I don't want to rub my knees raw. I'm like, oh, just wear some knee braces, okay? So I put some knee braces on. Dude, I've never felt so uncomfortable in my entire life. Mm. Like my feet were sliding off the bike. Like I didn't have any of this. I didn't have any efficiency. You know what I mean? It was the strangest thing.
Because there's something between you and the motorcycle.
Yeah, now I was locked. I wasn't moving from my hips to my toes or from my ankles. But now, you know, when I don't wear them, well, I can move at my knees. There's movement, 30-40% right there, and that's where the seat ends, right at your knees. I can feel the bike better. I'm skinnier. My leg is lighter. You know, if I hit the ground, I can move it out of the way.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? The same thing with neck brace. I had that on, same problem. I wore one time when and David Bailey came on and scared the shit out of everybody, which is completely incorrect because he wouldn't have been able to ride the way he rode if he was wearing a neck brace. No, his style was, you know, was. First corner I went in, I went over the berm because I couldn't see up. Yeah. I'm like, just not warmed up. Next corner, same thing. Boom, boom, boom. Went over the turn again because I couldn't see up. And I took the thing off and said, dude, throw that in the trash. Mm. You know, and again, yeah, I broke my back. I've been paralyzed. You know what I mean? Knee braces break femurs. Yeah, I just broke my femur.
Yeah.
So anything can happen. Anything can happen. But you cannot deny where the body's at its best and where the body's at its most efficient. Done.
Well, I've rolled out 3 ACLs with the best knee braces you can buy on every single time.
I've done. Yeah. I blew my first one without a knee brace, and then I blew it out the second time with custom-made knee brace.
And with this sport, you're not getting around that.
Yeah.
It's so violent and it's so harsh that the best thing to do is just make sure that you're prepared the best.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You're strong, you're stable, your mind is sharp from eating clean foods, your lifestyle is clean by, you know, quality sleep, quality food, quality rest, you know, quality water, your training is correct, you're not chasing an ego by look how great I am on a bicycle. You're not a bicycle racer, dude, you're a motocrosser. Mm. Right? And you're taking, you're also working in, not just always working out, working out, working out, working out. You're working in and allowing yourself to rest, you know, bringing in this yoga, bringing in meditation. Because again, this is the next stage of our sport, I believe, and like we're talking about is more the mind.
Well, Alden has his guys, most of his guys, I think they do yoga at least a few times a week.
They do. Because I remember Ryan Dungy, when I was actually staying with my sister for a little while after my divorce, my sister's married to Jade, and Ryan would stay there. And I remember I'd see him after riding a lot of evenings up in the spare room, TV on, and he was doing yoga. And one day he's like, don't laugh. And I'm like, dude, I tell you, I wish someone had told me how important it was, because when I fell, I bounced, and I didn't break many bones, but because I wasn't supple, I tore ligaments. Mm-hmm. And those are worse than breaking bones. And I mean, I can't touch my toes. I can't do anything. So honestly, like, I really wish someone would have told me, because when I was growing up, yoga was for girls. That's what the ladies did at the gym. I'm not going to go and do yoga and be the only guy. Then I look back and I'm like, what an idiot.
Yeah.
A room full of hot chicks and you're the only guy. Like, what were we thinking?
Hey, if you want to get into yoga, go down to Encinitas, California, and go to a yoga class. You'll fall in love 20 times.
Yeah.
I'm the guy in the back. No?
Yeah, exactly.
Well,
yeah.
So I've been CrossFitting for a couple of years, 3 years now, and I just really enjoy it. I enjoy the competitive part. My wife does it, so she and I, it's something we do together.
Nice.
But it made me really tight. Because it's really up to you to stretch after and roll and whatever you're going to do. And we get busy and you stop doing it and then you're like just fully locked up. So we've started doing at the fire station of all places. We were on 48 hour shifts. So the first day we'll do some type of HIIT workout. Mm-hmm. Second day we do yoga.
Oh, wow.
And, do you do it in a uniform?
No.
I was going to say, that would be a sight for sore eyes, seeing all these guys all dressed up.
Well, no, dude, it is. I mean, there's some guys that, you know, the big macho truck guys are like, oh, what is this? You know, but it's great, dude. Yeah. I get done and I feel way more.
You'll have less
up
pain.
And I mean, I'm a guy that's got, I get really tight hips because I got bad knees.
Yeah.
You know, it leads to tension and shit other places. And so I'm no good at it.
Yeah. I mean,
I'm the worst.
It saved my life from my back. You know, I started doing it 3-4 months before my back. You know, I just had this idea thing. I mean, I got to start doing yoga. And I had a gym. I walked out one day and some people were looking at the place right next door. I'm like, hey, what are you guys opening? And they're like, open a Bikram yoga studio. I'm like, wow, bitching. Cool. Okay. So I started doing that. And the first class I went in and they're like, yeah, okay, it's 105, this and that, 110 degrees, it's 90 minutes. And I'm like, and I get old lady walks in, this lady walks in, another lady. I'm like, fuck, I got this, you know. I went in there, dude. I started whimpering. It was so hot. I was so miserable because I wasn't flexible yet. So I'm trying to do all the
shaking. I know.
I'm competing. You know, I'm competing in yoga, and this other lady's over here just you know. And I get on the ground. I'm all, like, what in the hell? Where did that come from? You know, it was so. I was so miserable. So that really, you know, opened my eyes. And so I did it 3-4 months before my back injury. And then the doctor, you know, after that, we like kind of really don't know how you're walking. You shouldn't really be walking because T4 is somewhere. And they're like, the only thing we can say is because how strong you were and how flexible you were. And I'm like, I was never flexible. And so maybe that helped 5%, but sometimes that 5% is anything. And so
can be a
so
big
now
difference.
I've been addicted. You know, I've been on it for 7 years and I go 3 to 5 times a week and I do it all around the world. And I really enjoy the challenge. I really enjoy the subtleness to it and the focus of it, you know, and that I'm not trying to compete. I don't have to compete. I'm only competing against myself, but just the feeling.
Yeah.
Like, my body doesn't hurt, dude. It doesn't hurt. There's nothing on
that
my body
crazy.
Hurts. Nothing on my body hurts. I don't take any pain medicine. I don't take any Advil. I don't take anything. Of course, my diet is super, super clean without without the inflammation of gluten and dairy and sugar and all the bullshit. But that yoga there is like, it's been life-changing. Yeah. And every rider I get to do it consistently, I can see a difference on the track.
Yeah, for sure.
They're more patient, you know, because you learn not to panic in postures. Yeah. You know what I mean? If you panic, then you fall out of it. So I see them a little bit more patient, but also I see them softer on the bike.
Yeah.
I even noticed this with Dean, you know, Wilson, when I coached him. They're a little bit, they're softer. They have a little bit more flow. You know what I'm saying?
Because you're moving more.
Yeah, because how you do anything is how you do everything.
Yeah, so. I'm still not good. Like I said, she'd be like, all right, 1 foot, put this hand here. And I'm like, I got it. She goes, now reach back and grab your other foot. And I'm like, what the? Are you kidding me? And she's got her foot back here. And I'm nowhere near it.
Dancer's pose,
So, anyway, I'm getting there, right?
No, that's cool, man.
I do dig it.
That's cool. Awesome.
you know, obviously.
Yeah, get into a class, though, man. Go to a class where you have an instructor that's telling you how and telling you little
tips.
Well,
we've been doing the Peloton videos, right?
Okay, yeah.
And they're, I don't know. I don't know.
If you get into a hot yoga class, you know, and everybody there doing yoga and the teacher's giving you little tips on, okay, now do this, now pull this in, now that, this, then it really hurts. And then
it helps you as well.
Then
there's
a conscious energy. Everybody's there kind of for the same reason, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And
it'd be like a CrossFit class.
Yeah, then the hot yoga too, man. Because, again, all of us are like a bunch of steel. How do you remold steel? You got to heat it up. Yeah. You know, so that helps to get in that hot yoga. Yeah. So.
Yeah, I'd probably pass out as well if it was 105 the way I am now.
It reminds me of somebody trying to fix your golf swing, you know. All right, arm straight, bend this, butt back, knee bent, and, you know. And
keep your head down.
Because in the yoga, they're
like, feet,
chest up, chin to the thing, you know. But it's like, holy crap.
Yeah, and just doing that, you're like, you're already shaking.
Yeah.
What about just a couple more things I want to hit on here. General nutrition for the average guy. Not even talking competitive level racers.
Yeah.
What advice would you give? Just real general stuff.
General stuff is one. I would try to eat as organic as you can. You get what I'm saying? Pesticides, herbicides, dead soil, all these different things. Again, what you eat is what you become. Eat dead food. It takes your body more energy to digest and process that food than you get out of it. So again, a lot of people are just eating dead substances. And so I would eat more organic, you know, of course, try to eat more fruits, vegetables, live stuff, because live stuff has enzymes in them, and enzymes is a big, you know, is a big kind of, it's like the little degreaser of the body, you know, detoxes it and this and this. So, but again, for me, it's the biggest three things is one is gluten. Gluten, get off that because...
Even for people who don't have celiacs?
Oh, yeah, 100%. 100% because, one, it shuts off your lower abdominals or your lower intestine. So when it shuts off your lower intestine, it starts to get... Your food can get in there and start getting trapped in there and become rancid, right? It shuts off your lower abdominals. Your lower abdominals control your lower extremities, right? So that's why a lot of people have bad backs because their lower abdominals don't even work.
Mm. Well, and that sounds like another problem.
Yeah. So then inflammation... You know, inflammation in joints, inflammation in the body, puffiness. A lot of people can train, but they can't get rid of this last little bit around the gut. That comes from gluten. Mm-hmm. You know, headaches, migraines, backaches, skin problems, irritable bowel syndrome. I think there's 500 different problems that occurred. When I trained Jessica Patterson, she's had migraines. And she goes, I've been to doctors. I've been to this. I'm in my motorhome with the shades down and I can't even come out in the day. I say, get off your gluten. A week later, she's never had a headache since, and she lost 10 pounds, you know, just from the inflammation. So gluten is a big one. Again, do your research. Sugar. You know, sugar's huge. Sugar
is
massive.
That's my cocaine. I'm
massive.
A full-on sugar head.
But again, sugar has the same effect to the brain as cocaine. They say that cocaine or sugar is the most addicting substance you can almost be on. It's harder to get off It's harder to get off of heroin than it is to get off of sugar.
Should I get onto heroin so I can stop eating?
Yeah, get that. Amazing.
There you go. We'll fix you up real quick.
Yeah, you know that.
No
again,
more sweet tarts tonight.
Just pow. Yeah, you know, drinking quality water. You know, quality water. And then trying to get into a routine of when you're going to sleep, when you're waking up. The body loves a routine. You know, the body loves a routine. And so when you can get into that, then that creates discipline. When you can get into a routine, that creates discipline. And once you can have discipline, you know, then you can, it takes concentration, right? So it takes concentration to focus on the discipline to do something the same every single day. And then that discipline creates a routine. And that routine creates, you know, stability in your life. Creates, you know, it's like just like being a racer. You had a routine.
Yeah.
Even when you get dressed, you have a routine.
Yeah.
If you don't do that routine, you're like, you know, so... Yeah. That is really big in life is trying to do that. And again, there's times that you can't eat that well. So eat the best you can.
Yeah.
80-20 rule, you know. When that 80-20 rule starts to become easy, where 80% good, 20% well, then you can start going 85, 90, you know what I mean? And so when I live down by the coast now, and the people I live with, they're just, you know, they're purity. They're pure lifestyle. They don't drink. They don't sugar. There's no caffeine. They don't do anything. I follow my kind of... You know, my girlfriend now, she's on that way, and she's kind of led me more in that. She's on me, you know. I'm like, hey, you know, that's not good for you. You know, that doesn't work for him. I'm like, okay, you know. But once I got to that level, it's like, man, it's like you're on drugs.
Yeah.
I mean, you feel so good. You're so calm, you know, this and that. So that gluten, dairy, you know, because dairy creates pus in the body, this and that. I know, you know, we unfortunately make, you know, whey protein, but, you know, it is what it is. And then the sugar and stuff like that. Are the things that you kind of need to avoid. And when you can avoid these things, eat more organic, eat more things that are alive, eat, you know, quality water, then you start to see how, what feeling alive is. Because I feel so many people just feel dead and they don't know. If I could give everybody a pill of like, this is what it feels like to be completely healthy, everybody would change like that. But it takes so long to get out of shape that it takes that much long, that same time to get back into shape, back healthy. But everybody in this country wants quick fixes.
Yeah.
I want to be fit and healthy now. Mm. Yeah, but how long did it take you to get out? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And just like I'd been doing a bunch of colonics, you know, from this and that, and they say you need to do 45 colonics, one for each year. I'm like, holy shit, because you have so much stuff stuck in your body. And I'm like, wow. Yeah. You know, from all the stuff that we've been eating and things like that. And then again, the food industry is so polluted, right? Especially in this country.
You know, it pisses me off the old food pyramid.
No, that's designed for cows, dude.
It's crazy.
It's designed for cows. It's designed
all
to
breads and grains, and you know, and it's like
it's designed to make people sick, because if you have sick, dumb, unhealthy, unhappy people, they're easy to be controlled. But if you have a healthy, happy, motivated, inspired person, you can't control that person.
Yeah,
you know, you can't.
What about CBD oil? What's your thoughts on that?
I love CBD oil. I take it every day. I own a little bit of Floyd's of Leadville. My son works for the CBD company, so I feel, you know, it's a good product. Is it what everybody says, the holy grail? Nah. You know, because you can take CBD oil, but your rest of your life is complete shit. It's not going to work. It goes hand in hand. You have to have a full, you know, like the full wheel. Every spoke needs to be tight. The right tension.
Yeah.
You can't just have one spoke tight this way and the rest just fucking loose.
Yeah.
So CBD oils help me. They help with inflammation. They help with pain. You know, they help maybe with a little bit of sleep. But, you know, it's not like, oh, wow, like most people want to tell you it is. So should you put that into your routine? Yes. But don't say it's going to be the miracle cure, right?
I've started using it just with all this drama about it and whatever. I'm like, I'm going to see what all the fuss is about. And it's my – I've got – crappy knees, and they just ache, especially if I'm on them hard or riding a lot, and it has noticeably taken down the ache in my knees. So I mean, for me, I'm like, well, that's all I need to know, you know?
And it, you know, the same thing is with you know, I know you might want to cover your ears because you probably don't want to hear this, but no, because last year when I went on the road, I was like, you know what, I started drinking some beer, and I just, you know, I'd always like go chase beers at different places and try. I found some amazing beers in Melbourne, Australia. Some in Africa, just really cool. But man, my knees were hurting. I was aching a lot. You know what I mean? So that sugar in the alcohol and that gluten in the beer really started making my body hurt.
Wow.
You know, it really did. And then so after I got home on the 25th, I haven't had a beer or anything since December 26th, and I don't have that pain anymore. And it was strange, you know. So I don't really have that.
Nothing else changed other than
that. Nothing changed except that. I mean, I eat a little bit cleaner because not on the road as much. But that's the same thing. I was on the road. People would say, oh, it's so hard to eat good. No, it's just you're lazy, man. It's just you're lazy.
There is truth. There's truth to that.
You gotta. You know, if you have a hamburger, okay. Then if you only then take the bun off or whatever and just have that, you gotta have some discipline.
Yeah.
You know, or not get yourself so, because there's so many people that are so obsessed about staying on the routine. And if they go off it, they freak out. You know, and I'm not that guy. I know I always get right back on. So if I have one time, this had gluten and this had this. Well, shit. One time.
Once in a while, you gotta eat a damn In-N-Out hamburger, right? Like, I mean, they're just good.
Yeah, exactly. So that's kind of, you know, the scenario, you know, making sure you're moving, you know, making sure you got some yoga practice, making sure you have some quiet time in you too, like you have your own time. Mm-hmm. You know, you're not just so, you know, so constantly entertained by phone, by book, by TV, by people. You know what I mean? You have some of your alone time so you can ponder on some of the things that are going on, or let life talk to you. Let God talk to you, because if you're always output, 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 and you don't have any time to be quiet, well, how is anybody supposed to speak to you?
We're too busy.
Yeah, it's insane. So I haven't watched TV in a year. Mm. And now I watch TV, it's like, oh my God, how ridiculous, isn't it?
I was going to say, a lot of the shows are pretty weird.
So I haven't watched TV in a year, and it's amazing. You know what I mean?
I wish I could say that, but I think I've watched 12 hours of Game of Thrones over the last couple weeks.
Do they have a new one?
No, but I had never watched it.
I had never seen it. Dude, I did the same thing. I started watching it, and it was like I wake up at 5. I wake up at 4 in the morning to get a couple shows in before I have to get out the house.
I can't. We're trying to catch up because the last couple seasons are coming or whatever it is. And, dude, I'm so hooked in right now.
Oh, it's amazing, huh?
See, I'm the kind of person, I hear all this, and I go, all right, I'll get sucked into it, so I'm just not going to watch it ever.
You will get totally sucked.
That's why I won't watch it.
I'm not like a Dungeons & Dragons guy. No. Like, it seemed so stupid to me. I'm fully hooked.
Yeah, I was hooked on that, too.
All right. Well, shoot, man. Anything else? You know, a couple questions we always ask our guests as we're wrapping up is like, what kind of legacy do you want to leave? How do you want people to remember you when, you know?
Yeah, I think that, you know, how I wanted to be remembered is just by being real, you know, is being honest, is by, you know, wearing my heart, wearing my mind on my sleeve, you know, just, you know, a person that just, if you put them in a race, you know you're always going to see them at the finish line, so to speak. Just, you know, I wasn't the winningest guy, or was I the fastest guy? At times I was, but not consistently. And so, but I feel that I put that persona out there that just, you never quit. You never quit till you see the checkered flag. And, you know, put your life into something. You know, put your life into something. Because if you don't, you know, that time will come when you can't.
Yeah.
And again, the finish line isn't here yet. You know, we started, but the finish line isn't yet. We're still alive right now. So why are you stopping? And I see so many people stopping. And so that's kind of the legacy, you know, I want to lead is just, you know, just a very inspirational person just by the way he went about things, not by, oh, he was the fastest and he was a motocross guy. And, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
That got me a little inspired, I got to admit.
Well, listen, man, I've always appreciated how headstrong you were. Whether whether, you know, if you believed the sky was green, damn it, it was green. Yeah. You know what I mean? You were stubborn about it, but that led to you being a really good athlete and a really gnarly competitor. And what I really appreciate about you right now is how open you are.
Oh, yeah. Thanks,
half the people in this country are divorced.
Yeah, dude. But it's like 70% now.
Yeah, I was going to say it's more than half.
Well, so whatever. You know, but the fact that you're just open about it and raw and like, hey, this is me, I really appreciate that.
Yeah,
because
thanks, dude.
We don't. That's not common anymore.
Yeah, and that's the thing is that if you don't ever share it, then you might not ever help anybody.
Yeah.
And, you know, and again, and that's the thing is, man, when you go home, be thankful for what you got.
Amen.
You know, remember, start to learn what that woman's love language is and let, you know, and have your woman learn what that man love language is. You can't, you know, to me, the three things that cause the most problems in life are never taught. One, how to take care of yourself, how to manage yourself mentally, physically, and emotionally. Not taught anywhere. Two, how to have a relationship, how to understand a woman, how to talk to a woman, how a woman should talk to a man. Just because, again, we're two different creatures, but we're the same species, and we need to be talked to, looked at, and understood differently.
Well, that's meant to be modeled by your parents, right?
Yeah, but they're getting,
they don't talk to you about it. 70% of our
parents are divorced,
yeah. So you don't get that model.
No, and then also how to raise kids. You know, kids, woof, okay? My kids are 21 and 17. I'm like, woof. Okay, you know, they're amazing, beautiful kids, but that, you know, that's a lot of, as you guys know, that's a lot of responsibility.
We're still in the wheelhouse.
Yeah,
of the,
so those three things are never taught, but in school, what's taught is how to be ambitious, how to be more powerful, how to have more money, how to be more sexual, how to be better than everybody.
Yeah.
But these three things are causing you the most problems, right? And so I feel if you can share these things and share a little bit of your struggle or share some things that have helped you get out of this hole, because all of us have been there. Yeah, have I thought about, you know, suicide came into my head? Of course it has. It could probably come into everybody's head because we're only human beings, but it flashes in and, you know, it flashes out. But it's not like it's something that nobody's ever kind of thought about when they're in the dark times.
Yeah.
And but if you can relay that to somebody and somebody can hear that, well, maybe that helps them. Maybe they think they're the only one.
Yeah.
And then they think of three people that they looked up to and we're all shaking our head. They're like, oh, wow, I don't feel so lonely now.
Yep. Yeah.
I don't feel so isolated now. I'm not the only one. And that gives them maybe a little bit of a boost. So I don't give a shit what anybody thinks about me, you know. And I would much rather have these difficulties and much rather have these tests and much rather be challenged in life, because then I'm progressing in life, than just having this easy street.
It also makes you who you are.
Yeah,
it's molded you.
Yeah, so
Well, that's cool. I sure appreciate you coming on and appreciate the hell out
of dude, that was awesome, Ryno.
Thank you guys for allowing me to come on. I appreciate it. I've admired you guys. I've looked, watched you guys. I've raced against you guys, competed against you guys, had problems with you guys, you know, all this. But, you know, where we're at right now is seeing eye to eye and talking like men and understanding each other and understanding, you know, the struggles we've gone through and, you know, the challenges that we've had. And, That again, that's called connection now. Yeah. There's not separation. So, again, now the next time we see each other, I guarantee is going to be more of a hug than just a, hey, bud, what's up?
Yeah.
Because there's a connection, not a separation.
Yeah, for sure.
You know?
Well, that's part of the moto family that, like you talked about. And it sucks that we don't see each other. I mean, I bump into you a couple times a year, and we live probably 5 miles from each other.
Yeah.
That sucks.
Yeah.
But, you know, life's busy. It is what it is.
Yeah.
I got three jobs.
Yeah,
exactly. You know, and again, for me, the problem in this world is everybody has to have a label. Yeah. I'm a something different than you're a, and now my I'm a and you're a doesn't connect. And then so once you're something and I'm something, once we put a label on it, well, now we have indifference. And once we have difference, we have separation. Once we have separation, we have judgment. Once we have judgment, we have hatred. Now we can't hang out with each other just because you're a Kawasaki fan and I'm a Honda fan, so to speak. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Just even from politics to religion to races to countries to all this, that's the problem to me in this world is that separation. Mm. It's just a word. And what's a word? A sound. So we're hating each other, battling each other, separating each other over really just a sound.
Everybody needs to love everybody.
You know what I mean?
That's what I say.
it's true. And so that's where we can connect. It's I feel we can bring, you know, start bringing this shit house together.
Yeah.
Because damn.
It's out of control, right?
Woof.
Yeah.
Woof. Yeah. So anyways, we'll stop there.
All right. Ryno, thanks again. I really appreciate him coming on the show. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back.
WP is more than a store. We're truck and Jeep experts. From wheel and tire upgrades to full custom builds, 4WP has you covered. Do your rig right. Shop online or find your store at 4WP.com.
Counting all the assholes in the room. Well, I'm definitely not alone. Well, I'm not alone. You're a liar, you're a cheater, you're a fool. Well, that's just like me, you. And I know you too.
All right, welcome back. Good chat with Ryan Hughes. You know, he's he gets a little heat for being a little out there, but, you know, the whole unlock the hips thing and all that. But I'll tell you what, he actually has a lot of knowledge when it comes to racing and it comes to fitness and health. And, man, I found it informative. I was stoked on it.
Yeah. With Ryno, obviously, we've had our differences, as he mentioned, as races. And but since then, he's really, I don't know, I feel like he's really come around. Like, I used to think he didn't like me. And then over the years, I realized, hey, you know, we were competitors. And it's cool to see him. And he seems like he's pretty at peace at the moment, which, you know, after injuries and divorce and things like that, that can be tough for guys. So
yeah. Yeah, he's just definitely matured and still maturing, and wish him the best. Definitely going through some hard times, and broken femur is not the way you want to top that off.
Nah.
But it seems like he's handling it well. So we wish him the best, and I'm just glad that he came on. That was cool. I want to jump into our Decal Works Last Call segment. Graphics, plastics, seat covers, garage mats, accessories. Go check these guys out for anything that you need in that realm. You can order plastics with graphics already mounted on them. It's then just bolt them on, you're done. It's so nice, so convenient. These guys are just absolutely top shelf, next level. They are going to be giving away 5 tickets to the next show, so do that on our Instagram or Twitter page. Instagram is at Whiskey Throttle Show. Twitter handle is?
At W_throttle_show.
He can barely remember.
That's he's actually just got it down. It's actually it's pretty impressive.
It's terrible. But
took a while.
Leave us a note in there. We'll pick a winner from somebody. We maybe put out a question or something like that. But we've got a show coming up next week with Jeremy Twitch Stenberg. It's going to get a little smoky up here in the saloon. but he's going to be a lot of fun. There's a lot, a big misconception about who he is. And I'm anxious for you guys to really get to know him. If you don't, he is a really cool guy. It'll be a lot of fun. So Decal Works is going to be giving away 5 tickets to the show next week. Get on our Instagram or Twitter page and follow us, and you can win those. So let's jump into our last call segment. GL got on the horn and got this interview. Check it out.
Hello?
Dino, how are you, buddy? It's GL.
GL, what's happening, bro?
Hey, you sound like you're having a good day. Love to hear that, man. Good to hear your voice.
Yep, just actually just leaving my dock right now. I'm walking away from it. I was just fishing, but no dice tonight. No dice.
Oh, boy.
So it was nice, though. Nice sunset out here in Florida, so it's actually really relaxing. Pretty cool.
I can imagine. It's actually probably a good time of year to be there.
Yeah, at this time, like, the sunset, like, it's just over the lake. It's quite funny because a lot of us live here in Claremont, and on the same lake. Like, Kenny lives about half a mile from my house. And then Marvin and Cooper. It's actually pretty funny how many of us live here.
I know. That area has really become a bit of the new sort of motocross mecca. It's pretty crazy. So, hey, talking about this season, first of all, how was your off season? It had to be a little hectic. Where, you know, I was watching you through social media, putting everything together, 11th hour. How was that? And good job putting that all together.
Yeah, thank you. I think the off season it was pretty interesting for sure. You know, I was waiting for a while to see what Rockstar Husky were going to say, because there was a slight chance that I was going to be like a third 450 rider on that team. And Rockstar were really pushing hard for it, so it didn't end up happening. They just wanted to stay with 2 riders. So there was nowhere to go, so I had to do the privateer route. So, pretty much I went through a lot in the off-season. I feel like a few people kind of gave up on me, and it was definitely a tough pill to swallow, some things that went on, but I think it made me stronger in the end run, and I got off social media for 4 weeks, and I just really buckled down on my training and on my writing, and also putting this whole little team together that I did. So Rockstar were a huge help in my program, so they were really helpful, and you know, I just wanted to keep it small, out the sprinter, and it all came together. We got some cool sponsors. Ignite came on board, and it's a CBD brand, and that was pretty exciting and sparked some
controversy.
So yeah, it was good. So we had that, and then Artificial Grass Liquidators also helped me out, and then then I had to figure out my gear deals, and O'Neill, Alpine Stars, and 100% were on board. So it was interesting just because I went through a lot in off season. I took social media off completely and just really focused on what I had to get done. And, I was also, the new thing for me was doing all these deals by myself. I didn't have an agent or anything for the first time. So that was a big learning experience. So really it was just whole growing experience as well. So going into Anaheim, it was kind of funny, like, for the first time in years, I wasn't really even that nervous because I did everything I possibly could. I put my best foot forward, and that's it. So I think my mindset going into Anaheim was just, like, so good because I was just, I don't know, my main was free, and I wasn't really worried about anything. If I got 20th, I got 20th, you know, so I didn't have that pressure.
Yeah, well, it was a great start to the season, and obviously you put your team together. You were still on Husqvarna. Did they give you much, you know, factory support, or was it more just bikes and parts?
Yeah, they were actually really good help, and that was all through Rockstar that made that happen, because really I was going to ride any bike, and then Rockstar was like, no, we want you to stay on a Husky, you know, so I was like, okay, no problem. So then I was going to, you know, be on a Husky, and Mitch was going to do everything for me, you know. Mitch was on board and going to do it, and then Husqvarna says, we really like you on FMX if we're going to help you, because it's the global brand of Husqvarna. I said, okay, that's fine. But, you know, the thing with doing all, you know, Mitch doing all your stuff is that, you know, it's a one-stop shop, really. It's suspension, triple clamps, pay, whatever, all that stuff. So Husqvarna were awesome and said, okay, this is what we're going to do. And, you know, they ended up getting me a factory service engine. And it was only supposed to be for my race bike, but then they ended up getting me one for my practice bike, and man, it was crazy at first for sure. It was a lot of phone calls and stuff to make all this happen, and then Bobby Hewitt was also a huge help, and Scuba, and really the whole Rockstar Husky team were a huge help, even when I was a privateer. And then when Zach Osborne got injured, they wanted me to go on a team at the beginning of the season, but I just did so much work to put my whole deal together, and I was riding really well at the time. So they were like, okay, just, you know, keep doing what you're doing, but we're going to give you some more support and help. And they were prepping my bike during the week, my race bike. And it was definitely interesting. And then obviously when Jason got hurt, that was when they were like, okay, you know, we've supported
we need you
a lot. Yeah, you're getting on this team. So it was awesome, man. And it was funny just because when I went on that team, it was just like, it felt like I didn't even leave. You know, it was just the exact same. So it was a really easy, good transition.
Oh, that's cool. Well, you've had some strong rides this season. I mean, Anaheim 1, I think you had the crowd on their feet most of that main event. That was great to watch. You've been solid. Not quite on the podium yet. Are you satisfied with your season so far?
I wouldn't say satisfied yet, no, because, you know, the 450 class is just so stacked. It's like, one weekend, I can pass all these guys and beat them, and then the next weekend, the guy that I just passed got on the podium. So it's like, that's where I need to be, is on the podium, and I'm capable of it. You know, this past weekend, I qualified second, won 100th, like, of a second off of Tomac. Like, I almost had the pole, and then... just the racing, you know, I think I would have ended up maybe, you know, the last race with the fourth, you know, which would have been good, but I was making together myself. But I feel like my writing's really good. It's just making it all happen. It's a tough off. Realistically, I'm capable of the podium, and that's where I'll be, and I'd be satisfied with that. I'm fifth in points, and I just want to maintain in that top five, and that would be good. But I just want to lead laps and get that that feeling of being up front, because on the third main event this past weekend, I was in second for like a lap, and then I kind of jumped on the side of the track. It was just such a good feeling being up there, and you're like free. You're not like battling or trying to protect your line. And like, you know what it's like in the, you know, when you're from 5th to 10th, everyone's stuffing each other, and it's just fantastic, where the top three guys are really just hitting their mark, and they're taking off. So, I want to be up front for sure.
Yeah, and I couldn't agree with you more. The racing and the parity this year has been so close and so tight. It seems like if you're just a slight bit off, you're not even maybe a top 10 guy that night. So,
I know what you mean. It's crazy that, you know, and then it's just like the, you know, that triple crown, like 3 12-minute plus a lap races, like that was 51 race laps we did. So it's pretty wild. Like it's really became such a fitness game now, you know. Obviously the 20 minutes plus a lap, which is going to 25, 26, 27 lap main event.
Yeah.
It's really important to put yourself in good position and, you know, go all the way to the checkered. You know, sometimes if you put yourself in a bad position, you're kind of fighting the whole race and really gassing yourself out. Where it's important, that's why it's important to get that start when you hit your mark,
yeah,
and you're breathing and stuff like that. So it's really tough. This sport is gnarly. You know, like, you do those races and then you're up at 6 in the morning for your flight the next day, then, it's
gnarly. Oh, yeah. Well, Dino, thank you once again for taking some time out to come on the Whiskey Throttle Show. I think I speak on behalf of a lot of people. You're arguably the people's champion, and I think a lot of them rooting for you to be up on the podium, and we look forward to seeing you on there, buddy.
No worries. I appreciate it, and have a good night.
You too. Take care. Cheers.
All right. See you, mate. Bye-bye.
All right. Well, that was a good chat right there. Always good catching up and hearing that. We'll jump right into our four-wheel parts Get At Me Q&A. These guys are the bomb when it comes to anything off-road. So if you are looking for wheels, tires, lights, bars, steps, machine gun mounts, whatever you want, four-wheel parts has got it. At fourwheelparts.com, the number 4, four-wheel parts. Get on there and check those guys out. They also sell Method race wheels, all kinds of different tires, anything you want, man. Fourwheelparts.com. These guys are awesome. Donnie, what do we got in our four-wheel parts Get At Me Q&A today?
Yeah, Moto Gate Drop wants to know, do the mechanics prep the bikes at the current location when they're at a Supercross race, or do they haul them to the next location and prep the bikes there?
I think, correct me if I'm wrong, you guys will do it a little differently, but I think the standard procedure is to, after the race, they break them down that next day.
Yeah.
Some of them will bring engines back and have the engine builders back at the shop rebuild those motors. They're sent back. But they get the chassis stripped down and the work done the very next day before they fly out a lot of times. And then that way when they fly back into the next race, there isn't a ton of work to do. If there is a big issue,
they have time to sort it out.
Yeah, they got time to sort it out. So that's usually the way it goes. And but I think it changes team to team.
It's also convenience. You know, if you're at a stadium and you have to be out on the floor the next day, they might go to another stop, but usually they'll always work out of the truck, probably in the hotel parking lot of whether they've been staying or where they're going to go stay. And then what happens is, obviously, that truck is like a mobile shop. It's got everything they need in there, so they'll have all the engines and suspension, so they can rotate some stuff. And then an engine guy, when he flies home, will take that, book it on the plane. They'll have that rebuilt, bring it back so that there's more backup engines, and they rotate stuff. And then, you know, if they need a restock, a lot of times they'll go to a hotel, and you see behind the desk there's a pallet because some team had a delivery, and it's not often you see pallets showing up at hotels, but they'll restock the truck. You'll see the mechanics go and re-inventory everything, but they pretty much build their bikes on the road the whole time.
Well, obviously, budgets are different, but generally how many motors would they have on a truck for, like, a Ken Roczen?
3?
At least.
Yeah, I mean,
a lot of times it could be 4 to 5.
Be one in the bike, and then a spare, and then each rider will have a spare with maybe even a backup spare.
Yeah. There's usually a total of, I would say, on a 450 factory team for 2 riders, you could probably find close to 10 motors total. So, you know, between in-rolling chassis and just on a shelf or in a cabinet.
Yeah, and they'll break down a lot of bikes. I know, at least here anyway, we took 3 or 4 bikes and broke them completely down to parts, and that's what we stocked the shelves with. So there's total bikes, you know, sitting in the rig. They could build 3 bikes up or 4 bikes.
Yeah.
They definitely are not short of engines or parts.
No.
All right. Is rough riding, are we too thin-skinned as fans and riders for contact? Barsha Bowers, Muskin Tomac?
I think that each incident has to be looked at individually,
yeah,
right? Like,
people start blanketing more of the outcome. So you could smash someone. If you both stay up, they don't say anything. But if one guy launches the bike off the berm and looks dramatic, they're like, oh, that was gnarly. And you're going, well, if you actually look at the science behind it, you didn't really do anything wrong. The other guy didn't react.
Yeah, I think you have to look at intent a little bit, right? Like, if a guy, maybe they had a scuffle in a heat or practice.
But that's what happened with the whole Barsha Bowers thing, is people saying, oh, well, Bowers retaliated. He got DQ'd and Barsha didn't. you know, people said, yeah, this goes all the way back to Vegas last year when Barsha smashed. I mean, Barsha's hit everyone. and if you look what happened with him and Bowers, he doesn't get up and have a temper tantrum. Like, he probably knew that was going to come. You know, what goes around comes around. But I think the officiating, to me, at times is a little wishy-washy. There's not a reason. They don't explain it well enough when they do dock someone, why they docked him. And they don't explain why a move that looked exactly the same, there was no repercussions afterwards. So I do think that there's a gray line. There really is a gray line. It's hard to say passing or block passing is black and white. But there needs to be more of a standard of what's acceptable and what's not. Because even someone like myself, I sit here and go, I don't really know what they're going to approve or not approve as far as a legal pass.
It's subjective. That's the bottom line. You can't make a rule that says, well, if you hit them here or if you are not turning when you get to them or whatever. You can't make a rule like that. It has to be someone's call.
Yeah.
Right? And maybe they make it between two different officials or, you know, I don't know how what the right way to do it is, but it's going to come down to somebody's call.
Yeah.
Right now it's John Gallagher. He makes the decisions. And it's going to be his decision. And you know what? You got to live with it. I do wish there was a little bit more consistency with what they with some of their calls.
Yeah.
But to me, when you have a payback incident like that, you got to do something. Is a DQ, and then the next part of that question is, okay, what's a good penalty? Is
here's
a fine?
My thing.
Is it a you know, point, take his points away, or is it a DQ?
But then you're saying no one has a chance to retaliate. So you could come hit me. Now I'm not allowed to hit you because I'm going to get in trouble. I have a problem with that. To me, they should know, okay, Ping hit GL. There's a good chance he's going to hit him back. And then pull them aside and sit him down and say, all right, cut this shit out. Like,
yeah. Well, I'm just saying, if it's my opinion, I'd say let it be the fuck death match out there. I don't care. Let them smash into
each
other.
That's what the fans want.
That's what the fans want. Feld wants it. You can say what you want. They use all those clips in the highlight reels year after year after year. Yeah, they got Weston pounding the crap out of Freeze, and they use that thing up. It's good entertainment, and that's what Feld's in the business of. They're trying to keep riders safe. I get that. But again, if you can't come up with some sort of clear delineator of this is legal and this isn't, this will be penalized and this won't, here's what the penalty will be and this is what it'll be here, then screw it. I say, you know, short of laying hands on another rider, because obviously that's clear cut. You take a swing, you grab their helmet, you do this, you're out. DQ.
Well, yeah, now you're
but
taking
on the track. My personal opinion, let it rip.
Let him race.
Let it rip.
Let races race. Yep.
Let it rip, tater chip.
That's what I say. Patrick well, look at Potatoes even, coming in hot.
Look at AC even said that they told him not to retaliate against RJ Hampshire.
I know. And
I'm glad they never told me that when I raced because I would have told him where to go shove it.
He made a good point. He goes, it's like, you know, you're out on the playground and somebody punches you in the face and the teacher comes over and goes, you can't hit him back. It's like...
My theory is I'm going to punch him back twice as hard. That way they won't do it again.
Should we have a panel of like three former racers that can actually make a call and on
well,
what
they
doing?
Need to be better at calling. Like, if you think back to remember when Chad Reed got black flagged, and I said, I thought that was total bullshit, to be honest, what they did. And Reed had a good point. He said, go look at any other sport. They'll say, we'll review afterwards and make a decision. Once you black flag that guy, you've damaged his reputation. It's DQ'd. It's over. You can't say, you know what? Maybe I prematurely did. Do it properly. And I think that they're dropping the ball in that department.
Yeah, agreed. There's no reason to black flag somebody mid-race.
No. Or go, you know what? I saw that move DQ'd, yelling from the control tower.
Because there's no
way
John Gallagher was watching Reed and saw everything that happened leading up to that, right?
He's probably got a radio that, Reed deliberately took out.
That wasn't even that bad. He didn't even touch Kennard, pushed him to the outside, and Kennard had the opportunity to stop if he didn't want to hit the hay bale. Kennard, believe me.
Yeah, so do I. But he hit Reed, took them both out. Reed was pissed. He just basically ran him out of road. Kennard was the one not paying attention. If he was actually riding, that would have never happened. But anyway, I just think that sometimes decisions shouldn't be made right there and then on emotion. Because anyone can tell you, when you make emotional decisions, you are going to be wrong at some point.
How about this take? Stop being such a bunch of pussies and let the guys race.
There you go.
You know what the fine will be? A broken foot if they smash into each other too hard. There you go.
There you go.
All right. Tips from the pro.
That's all we got.
That's it?
That's it.
Well, it has been a long show, so it's probably good.
We're going to wrap it up. We've been long. Do want to thank Pro Circuit. They come on board with us, and... We love their stuff. Pro Circuit 78, if you're looking for them on Instagram, procircuitracing.com, procircuit.com rather. Check them out.
We had three Pro Circuit riders here.
Yeah, we really did. We were really representing Mitch and his team today.
Yes,
so.
Donnie didn't get his contract in the mail, so he missed out. He was meant to be the fourth PC rider.
Nobody got me one.
Maybe Mitch will build him a PC exhaust for his there airplane.
Yeah.
Oh, that'd be cool.
Yeah. Yeah, no, he's not going to do it. Also, Adidas. Big thanks to Adidas. Get out there and get you some three stripes. Check those guys out. We'll have some more cool stuff with them coming up. I want to thank our sponsors again for just really backing this show, PowerDot. If you're going to go pick one of these up, type in Whiskey Throttle, get you 20% off. Method Race Wheels, Troy Lee Designs, obviously, as I mentioned, look for that new retro GP gear that's coming out. It's insane.
That's cool.
I'm going to hopefully have some Instagram posts of that stuff up here soon. Decal Works, Dunlop, Racer X, Langston Motorsports, Paleo Ranch Foods. Thank you guys for watching. Big thanks to Ryan Hughes for coming out. We've got a live show next week, so be sure to get in here to the saloon if you are in the area. You can go to roadtorecovery.com, hit the shop tab. You can buy tickets there. You can buy them at the gate. It's $20, free beer, free pizza, and a great time. Come check us out. Thanks for watching. We'll see you guys next week. On the ankle box, we're there.